The narrative commences with the protagonist immersed in contemplation, observing a cluster of fallen individuals. He ponders whether he possesses the potential to ascend as an esteemed hunter, akin to the one he revered in the guild premises earlier. Discussions abound regarding guilds, orchestrating the clearance of several intermediate dungeons, presenting risks for lone adventurers. A bulletin catches his eye. Elite combat unit seeks skilled assassin. Prior experience advantageous. A subsequent announcement states elite combat unit, in search of a gold tier mage, competitive remuneration. An advert for Battle Royale mentions the need for a compact storage unit. Opportunities are scarce. He signals to appear, noting the return of a healer, now shunned by guilds. The companion advises departure to evade unwanted affiliations. Abruptly, an individual approaches, declaring a discovery and recognizing the protagonist. A female acquaintance joins, expressing delight in their reunion and commending his reputed progress. They extend an invitation for dungeon exploration, proposing a venture not overly arduous to the protagonist, identifiable by his violet hair, touts his healing capabilities, pledging assistance. He humorously urges compliance, referencing his valid license. In the vicinity, a grand magical orb manifests, marking the entrance to a dungeon of normal difficulty, with a maximum occupancy of 10 adventurers. Within, unseen creatures exude mystical energies, initiating battles that lead to a declaration of the sole survivor. The protagonist, eyes concealed by a blindfold, prompts immediate action. The violet-haired ally responds, deploying a spell to no avail. An ally suggests targeting a creature radiating energy first. The female companion conjures a magical formation, directing her power to ensnare the beast. Subsequently, the main character unveils a newly mastered technique, brandishing his blade to execute a critical strike, severing the creature's head. The violet-haired companion queries about his enhanced strength. As the severed head releases a dazzling glow, the protagonist contemplates his potential for such power. With the creature's head dispersing, he casually rests the sword on his shoulder, evaluating its suitability for another, and decides to pass it to his violet-haired friend, suggesting it might bolster his prowess. The recipient grasps the weapon, while another member advises fortifying their abilities prior to their next endeavor, acknowledging the day's trials. The protagonist expresses his appreciation to the individual with purple hair. Suddenly, fissures appear in the dungeon's ceiling, prompting them to proceed with caution. The female companion suggests a pause, inquiring if any sounds were discernible. The blindfolded protagonist offers to share his fortunate discovery. Unexpectedly, a creature of stone emerges, indicating the presence of a concealed boss. Drawing his weapon, he recognizes the gravity of their predicament. The creature emits an intimidating presence, focusing its attention on them. Concerns are raised about the formidable nature of hidden bosses, though reassurance comes from noting the frequency of such challenges. The protagonist advises careful observation. Another party member underestimates the threat, leading to a rebuke. This individual advances towards the boss, employing a sacred ability. Nevertheless, the boss counters with rapid force, resulting in dire consequences. The group is left aghast at the sudden turn of events. The blindfolded leader suggests employing foresight abilities to gauge the boss's capabilities. The analysis reveals daunting statistics, heightening the group's alarm. Yet, he reassures them, emphasizing the significance of collaboration and tactical planning. Rallying the team, he underscores their survival hinges on a unified offensive and the safeguarding of their healers. They engage the boss, enduring its attacks while strategically countering. Throughout the confrontation, the depletion of the boss's vitality is noted. The leader cautions against overconfidence, advocating for sustained aggression and vigilant defense of their healing members. The creature executes a lateral swing aimed at the protagonist, who skillfully evades and counters with a sword strike. The barrage of magical assaults persists against the concealed adversary. The woman with flowing hair emphasizes the necessity of continuous aggression. Cessation is not an option. The mages escalate their offensive, casting fire spells that culminate in a formidable explosion. The individual wielding a dagger observes that despite the hidden boss's elevated statistics, the intensity of their attack guarantees its downfall. The resultant explosion generates a vast dust cloud adjacent to the adversary. Yet the creature withstands the assault, regarding them with a malevolent glare. The protagonist expresses astonishment, questioning the efficacy of their strategy, and noting the boss's unscathed state, which seems to have incited further hostility. The creature launches a powerful lateral attack, overwhelming one of the warriors, with the aftermath visibly impacting the surroundings. As the boss's menacing gaze sweeps over them, the team rallies, with a member advocating for relentless assault given the boss's dwindling vitality. The adversary levitates, a hand emanating potent magical energy. With a deliberate motion, it unleashes a formidable beam striking its target. The protagonist, eyes concealed, queries if this act signifies a rage capability or a hidden boss's onslaught. The entity offers a sinister smile in response. The individual with violet hair inquires about the nature of a rampage, questioning the continuation of the hidden boss's existence. The female companion explains that rampage is a distinct state for bosses, triggered when their health drops to a critical threshold, significantly boosting their statistics. She notes the rarity of such a mode, expressing surprise at its activation by this particular boss. Faced with uncertainty, the violet-haired figure questions their survival prospects. The blindfolded protagonist remains optimistic, suggesting they possess sufficient time for him to amass strength and employ his sword for a decisive strike. Questioning the feasibility of this plan, his companion seeks reassurance. The protagonist maintains that the outcome remains uncertain until the attempt is made. The female ally assures them of her unwavering support throughout the ordeal. As she prepares to unleash a spell, a radiant aura emerges beside her. The blindfolded warrior asserts to the boss that its end is imminent. He advances for the attack, poised to strike. The boss, in turn, prepares a rapid counterstrike. The warrior, undeterred, questions the adversary's resolve to continue resisting. Observing the boss's movements, he successfully lands his attack. The boss ascends, radiating magical energy. Seizing the moment, the warrior proclaims the boss's regret for its defiance. As the boss readies to unleash a surge of magical energy, manifesting a vast magical orb, the warrior declares the confrontation escalated excessively, evading an incoming attack. He signals the critical moment for action. A spell narrowly misses him, and he urges the mages to launch their offensive immediately. The woman with flowing hair gathers a formidable amount of fire energy overhead, invoking the Red Lotus Flame spell. The boss, caught off guard by this magical onslaught, is engulfed in a massive explosion. The blindfolded warrior declares the effort insufficient. Their assault must persist. He charges, his sword aglow with mystical energy, propelling it into the epicenter of the detonation. He impales the boss, asserting the creature's impending demise. So the final sword thrust, the boss disintegrates into numerous stones. The individual with violet hair queries the success of their endeavor. The woman responds, doubting the boss's survival post such a potent attack. They observe the lingering flames, a testament to their fierce battle. A voice rises, proclaiming their achievement. The blindfolded protagonist looks back, acknowledging their triumph. However, the astonishment is palpable when the woman with cropped hair insists the foe remains undefeated. As the smoke dissipates, the boss stands, unharmed and smirking, defying their expectations. The woman with cropped hair urges retreat, the boss evidently unscathed. With alarming speed, the boss charges, his roar echoing fury. He zeroes in on the woman, her disbelief mounting at his untouched condition. The adversary materializes before her in a blink, severing her head with a swift hand motion. Her head drops to the floor, leaving the group in shock at the abruptness of the assault. The blindfolded protagonist insists they cannot remain idle. Escape is imperative. In seconds, the boss manifests behind the woman with lengthy hair. The man with a blindfold and violet hair cries out in dismay, yet the fiend ends the woman's life with a single ruthless strike. He then pivots towards the remaining humans, intent on further carnage. The group deliberates their next move, questioning if any action can subdue this beast. The boss confronts three men, swiftly overpowering several individuals, followed by a thunderous roar of fury. The blindfolded man, fueled by rage, questions how such a tragedy could unfold. With a roar of his own, he charges at the boss. The boss, unfazed, greets his charge with a grin, as the blindfolded warrior vociferously challenges him. A surge of magical energy is unleashed from the boss's hand, culminating in a potent explosion that envelops the warrior. The man with purple hair stands aghast. The blindfolded warrior has vanished, with only his great sword left embedded in the earth. The individual with violet hair collapses, lamenting their doomed fate and questioning the sequence of events. He ponders whether the monster deliberately targeted him last due to his perceived weakness, feeling even the creature disdains him. He recalls criticisms of being too frail, a burden, and a resource drain, labeled as expendable, futile, and disparaged. Overwhelmed, he shields his head, attempting to deflect these thoughts. His gaze shifts to his fallen comrade's sword. A voice reassures him that he does not embody those derogatory labels. He possesses the strength to vanquish the boss. The blindfolded friend encourages him to rise and wield the sword, promising success. Clutching the sword, he questions his capability, contemplating that if his end is inevitable, it should be in battle. As the monster's silhouette encroaches, he lifts his gaze, resolute to fight for survival. The adversary scrutinizes him with scorn and gestures for him to approach. Rising, he declares his intent to face death with purpose, vowing not to perish as the weak might. He charges at the monster, initiating his attack. The creature counters with a swift strike, connecting with the man. Undeterred, he retorts, promising mutual destruction. His sword finds its mark, impaling the monster and eliciting a piercing howl from the beast. With its dwindling energy, the monster delivers a final blow to the man's head, rendering him unconscious. As darkness claims him, he whispers of vengeance fulfilled, allowing for peaceful repose. Light emanates from the wound inflicted on the monster, which begins to disintegrate, awakening in an expanse of white. He ponders his whereabouts, questioning the nature of the afterlife and the possibility of reunion with fallen comrades. Observing his attire remains intact, he muses on his apparent survival, contradicting his earlier assumption of death. Lifting his gaze, he is greeted by a system window manifesting before him, displaying a dungeon notification. It heralds the completion of the last High Priest, listing the criteria met: through successful dungeon clearance, the defeat of a secret boss, the unfortunate demise of all comrades, and the fulfillment of the healer class role. Subsequently, the narrative shifts to a grim scene where the vanquished boss consumes the flesh in its grasp. Perched atop the remains of the fallen, the creature devours its victim, a sight that petrifies the observer with violet hair. The consumed is identified as his ally, intensifying the horror of the spectacle. The monster then pivots, its gaze locked on him as it advances with deliberate steps. Paralyzed with fear, he watches as the boss positions itself ominously close, its eyes radiating an intense light. With a malevolent grin, the monster extends its hand towards his head. Abruptly, the scene dissolves and he awakens in his bed, recognizing the ordeal as a recurring nightmare. Songran, a healer known for his notably less effective skills, finds himself ostracized by most adventuring parties, becoming a subject of widespread mockery. His predicament only worsened after a dungeon expedition a few weeks prior, where he emerged as the sole survivor following a hidden boss encounter that claimed the lives of his only companions. Despite the guild's lack of inquiry into the matter, tales of the cursed healer swiftly circulated, suggesting he was unworthy of allies and deserved his isolation due to his minor role. Upon opening the refrigerator, Songran remarks on the scarcity of provisions, noting only a single water bottle remains. Acknowledging the necessity to venture outside, he consumes the water. He comments on the neglect of his living space, untouched for a month, and the limited wardrobe at his disposal. Donning his hood to conceal his identity, he departs from the solitude of his home, navigating through the bustling city streets. With a weary glance, he braces himself, murmuring, "Here we go," as he steps into the anonymous crowd. Upon entering a grocery store, Songran is greeted with a customary welcome. Nearby, patrons engage in conversation, one inquiring about recent events. Another responds, referencing the tragic incidents in a dungeon a few weeks prior, where a healer was the sole survivor. A passerby interjects, curious about the topic. The first speaker elaborates on the dungeon tragedy, mentioning rumors of the surviving healer who allegedly betrayed his team for personal gain. Questioning the veracity of these claims, the passerby is assured by the informant, who cites a reputable source from the guild. The conversation takes a turn as the first speaker expresses disdain for the healer, suggesting a confrontational ability against him. The second speaker jests about the first's capability, leading to a retort not to underestimate his potential. Rand approaches the checkout counter with his groceries, indicating his readiness to purchase. The saleswoman greets him, announcing the total as 198 yuan, and inquires whether he will be paying with cash or card. The man presents his card for payment, to which she asks for a moment to process. Upon swiping the card, she expresses surprise, apologizing for the insufficient funds, suggesting he can only afford bread. Accepting the situation, Ran opts for the bread alone. The saleswoman hands over the bread and his card, encouraging him to return. Exiting the store, Ran is greeted by the glaring sun, marking his first venture outside in weeks. He reflects on the improbability of joining a team for income, acknowledging his lack of companionship and pondering his next move. The only viable option appears to be Uno, a beginner dungeon designed for novice hunters to hone their skills, located at the city's heart. Despite its minimal challenge and correspondingly low reward, Ran resolves that it's his only choice, given his desperate circumstances, as it at least offers a means to fend off starvation. An observer, upon noticing Ran, queries, "Min, is that Songran, the healer renowned for his inadequacy? What purpose does he have here?" Min responds with amusement, uncertain of Ran's motives for visiting a dungeon tailored for novices, questioning his combat readiness. Upon entering the portal, Ran is greeted by a system message welcoming him to the beginner's dungeon, prompting him to question the novelty of such an alert. The system announces the initiation of a test phase, congratulating him on qualifying for a new feature. The dungeon will unveil an evolutionary mode designed for him, promising an engaging experience. Ran, puzzled, inquires about the nature of the evolutionary mode and expresses distaste towards the dense blood mist enveloping him. It appears his sword, referred to as the Evolution Blade, is reacting to the surroundings, leading him to ponder the forthcoming events. Upon Song Ran's entry into the dungeon, a system notification materializes outlining the beginner level. Colliterate 100 Earth Elementals, surprised by the magnitude of his task. Ran reflects on his initial expectation of facing merely a trio of foes, pondering the source of such a vast number. Surveying his surroundings with a sense of foreboding, he witnesses the emergence of stone appendages from the Earth, signaling the rise of the Elementals. Confronted by one of these gargantuan creatures, Ran questions the unprecedented size and enhanced offensive capabilities of the Earth Elementals, noting their sluggish movements despite their formidable appearance. Acknowledging the complexity of the challenge, he nevertheless maintains confidence, considering the beginner-level status of the dungeon should theoretically limit the threat posed by the Elementals. Opting to engage without the aid of his sword initially, Ran decides to assess his own strength through direct confrontation, ready to adapt his strategy as necessary in the face of these stone adversaries. Ran decides to forgo his weapon, opting to confront the Earth Elementals with nothing but his physical prowess to gauge his strength. However, the intensity of the battle quickly escalates as magic sparks fly from the monster's strikes. Despite a valiant effort, Ran acknowledges the formidable power of his opponent, realizing that victory with his bare hands is beyond his current capabilities. Recognizing the necessity for a more effective approach, Ran summons his evolutionary blade, prepared to face the next assault. With a swift and precise attack, he vanquishes the elemental, pondering the sudden surge in his strength. The monster crumbles, leaving Ran to face new adversaries as two more Earth Elementals emerge, allowing him no respite. Determined, Ran activates basic skills to enhance his strength, speed, and stability, underscoring the potential underestimation of a healer's combat efficacy. He prepares to engage the newly appeared foes, ready to demonstrate the full extent of his capabilities and adaptability in the face of relentless challenges. As Ran confronts the onslaught of Earth Elementals, he advances with determination, swiftly disarming one with a precise strike of his sword. Encircled by the horde, he dispatches his foes methodically, his skill and resolve undiminished. Amidst the fray, notifications flood his vision, each confirming his escalating prowess. Facing down the final elemental, he exhibits unwavering focus, effortlessly evading its clumsy attack to deliver a decisive blow, severing its head. The system commends his achievement, marking the completion of the beginner's challenge and rewarding him with Earth Essence, a valuable resource for weapon enhancement. Exhausted yet triumphant, Ran acknowledges the unexpected rigor of the ordeal, surprised by the physical toll it exacted. No sooner does he catch his breath than the system presents him with a new trial. The annihilation of 100 water elementals. Confronted with this unforeseen directive, Ran's confusion is palpable, prompting him to question the nature and purpose of these relentless tests. Ran's curiosity about Earth Essence, the reward he received, prompts him to inquire about its nature and utility, given its unfamiliarity and apparent significance. The system explains Earth Essence as a concentrated form of Earth energy, characterized by a potent and dense aura. When synergized with a weapon, its effects remain unpredictable. Holding the Earth Essence, Ran acknowledges its value yet grapples with the immediate relevance of such an item under the pressing circumstances. With the looming challenge of subsequent tasks and the palpable threat of demise within the dungeon, he recognizes the urgency of his situation, contemplating the strategic application of his newly acquired asset amidst the uncertainty of the trials ahead. Ran's attention is captured by a dazzling illumination, prompting him to shield his eyes and question the source of the anomaly. His astonishment grows as he identifies the phenomenon as an intense snowstorm, an abrupt and unexpected weather change that leaves him puzzled. He connects this sudden snowfall to his current quest, speculating on its relation to the water elementals. As he observes objects descending from the heavens, Ran initially wonders about their nature. Upon closer inspection, he realizes these are not mere snowflakes but water elementals, transforming upon contact with the ground, acquiring faces and limbs, and adopting a more menacing appearance. Ran notes this development with a sense of anticipation, recognizing that these elementals have evolved, indicating a heightened challenge in fulfilling his mission. Ran swiftly closes in on the water elemental, leaping to deliver a sword strike to its arm. Landing gracefully, he realizes his assault inflicted no damage, leading to frustration over the ineffectiveness of his attack. As the elemental counterattacks, Ran scrutinizes it for any sign of injury, puzzled by the lack of impact from his efforts. Determined, he launches another attack, suspecting the creature possesses regenerative abilities. His analysis reveals the ice elemental shares similar defensive traits with the earth elemental, notably high resilience and a restorative capability, making the water elemental a formidable adversary due to its constant regeneration. Faced with this daunting challenge, Ran contemplates the possibility of defeat at the hands of these ice elementals, questioning his survival in this relentless encounter. Upon receiving the system's prompt that the prerequisites for augmenting his weapon with Earth Essence have been met. Rand ponders the timing of such an upgrade. Nevertheless, recognizing the potential benefits, he opts to proceed with the enhancement. He consents to the merge. And as his sword becomes shrouded in energy, he queries the completion of the process. The system confirms the successful integration, endowing his weapon with a potent new ability. Petrification at its maximum level. This skill grants his sword the power to impose a petrification effect upon adversaries, significantly reducing their movement speed by 50, obstructing any regenerative capabilities, and diminishing their defense by 30. Armed with this upgraded arsenal, Rand prepares to confront the water elementals anew, now equipped with a strategic advantage against their formidable regenerative prowess. Rand, emboldened by the newfound power of his weapon, muses that fortune seems to be on his side, seizing what he believes to be a pivotal opportunity. With a surge of confidence, he engages the elemental, which to his astonishment becomes immobilized by the petrification effect. Capitalizing on this advantage, he delivers a series of decisive strikes, shattering the once formidable adversary into fragments. Emboldened by his success, Rand proclaims his readiness to confront the horde of monsters before him. He advances, employing his sword with precision and agility. His eyes alight with determination, he ascends to meet the towering foe, unleashing a flurry of blows that dismantle the monster's form. Surrounded by the remnants of his vanquished foes, Rand stands victorious, declaring the completion of his fierce battle amidst the silent testimony of elemental defeat. As Rand reviews the quest progress, noting 99 out of 100 water elementals defeated, he finds himself perplexed by the absence of the final adversary. Turning in search of the elusive foe, he witnesses a convergence of magical energy emanating from the vanquished elementals, leading him to question whether the defeated foes are amalgamating into a more formidable entity. His speculation is confirmed with the emergence of a female figure clad in ice armor, prompting Rand to wonder if he's facing the Snow Queen herself, a being of ice elemental prowess. He half-jokingly considers whether this encounter with what appears to be a hidden boss is a stroke of luck, or yet another formidable challenge. The Snow Queen, seemingly an enhanced version of the Ice Golem, represents a daunting opponent. Despite his proven strength, Rand is acutely aware of his diminished health from previous skirmishes, casting doubt on his ability to withstand another intense battle. In preparation, Rand employs a basic healing skill, surrounding his injuries with a rejuvenating green aura, bolstering his resolve to face what may be his ultimate challenge. He reflects on his journey, having endured numerous confrontations, and braces himself to discover if this battle will mark his end or yet another testament to his survival. Rand, undeterred by the challenge before him, decides to test his mettle against the Snow Queen, theorizing that if she and the Ice Golems are variant ice elementals, his petrification ability might prove to be his ace in the hole. With swift determination, he advances towards the boss, hoping to immobilize her with his petrification skill. Yet, his attack fails to inflict any damage, leaving him baffled and questioning the efficacy of his strike against her formidable defenses. The situation grows more dire as the Snow Queen summons an ice sword enveloped in potent energy, signaling the onset of a powerful ultimatum attack. Rand, taken aback by the immediacy and intensity of her assault, watches as a barrage of ice shards descends from the sky. Recognizing the severity of the threat, he executes evasive maneuvers to dodge the deadly cascade, acknowledging the overwhelming strength of her ultimate ability. In the midst of this perilous onslaught, Rand identifies a pivotal moment to counterattack, viewing this critical juncture as his opportunity to turn the tide of battle. Faced with the daunting prowess of the Snow Queen, he realizes that mere evasion is insufficient. Preparing to seize his chance, Rand readies himself for a strategic offensive, determined to overcome the formidable adversary before him. Accelerating towards the Snow Queen with unmatched speed, Rand evades her assaults with agility. He leaps, delivering a strike while confidently declaring the hit. He realizes that his attacks not only disrupt the boss's current maneuvers, but also hamper her ability to execute subsequent ones. Rand deduces that by preventing the Snow Queen from deploying her ultimate skills through continuous hits and evasive tactics, he could secure victory against this formidable foe. With this strategy in mind, he engages optimistically, stating that overcoming the boss will be straightforward if he maintains this pattern of attack and dodge. In a display of resilience, Rand finds his attack thwarted by the Snow Queen's shield. Retreating momentarily, he contemplates whether his sequential strikes might surpass the strength of the boss's ultimate move. Committing to a relentless barrage, he meticulously counts each hit, culminating in a staggering 99,999 strikes that finally shatter the Snow Queen's defense. Another blow secures him a commendation from the system for achieving a 10,000 hit combo, along with the unlocking of the deadly attack ability. This newfound ability, which remarkably requires no mana to execute, enhances normal attacks to bypass the opponent's defense and inflict 10 additional damage, albeit at cost of depleting one of Rand's health with each strike. Faced with this critical juncture, Ran interprets the unlocking of the ability as a divine challenge, resolving not to falter. With his resolve steeled, he prepares to test the limits of the Snow Queen's endurance against his relentless assault. As the Snow Queen attempts a counterattack with her sword, Ran, poised and undaunted, activates the deadly attack ability. His subsequent strike not only inflicts significant damage but also disarms the boss by severing her arm, eliciting a scream of agony. Enraged and enveloped in formidable magical energy, the Snow Queen braces for a pivotal clash, signaling the escalation of their epic confrontation. Ran challenges the Snow Queen, questioning how she copes with the loss of her hand, only to witness it miraculously reattach, a testament to her formidable regenerative capabilities. Acknowledging her resilience, he concedes that defeating her may not be as straightforward as anticipated. The Snow Queen, undeterred, levitates, engaging Ran with a sword strike that he skillfully parries, generating a gust of wind from the sheer force of the impact. Determined, Ran asserts that he must end the battle with a decisive blow. Despite a powerful counter from the Snow Queen, Ran manages to deflect the attack and repel her. In a swift counteroffensive, the Snow Queen launches an aerial assault, which Ran narrowly evades. He analyzes the battle, seeking the opportune moment for a critical strike. Executing a mid-air spin, Ran delivers a sword strike, only to find the Snow Queen unscathed by his attempt. As their duel intensifies, Ran parries her relentless attacks, attempting a punch that misses its mark. Surprised by her agility, Ran watches as the Snow Queen ascends, gathering a surge of magical energy, signaling the escalation of their epic confrontation. Ran braces for the Snow Queen's formidable power surge, determined to prevent her from unleashing her full potential. Amidst a maelstrom of ice shards directed at him, he vows to end her reign. Their swords clash in a final, decisive exchange, unleashing an explosive burst of magical energy. Triumphantly, the Snow Queen is vanquished, her essence scattering like frost in the wind. Ran navigates the aftermath, ice shards orbiting the remnants of her defeat. The system heralds his victory, rewarding him for completing the second beginner-level task with a water essence note, a component for weapon enhancement. Curious about his new prize, Ran learns that the water essence, a shard imbued with a frigid aura, offers an opportunity to further augment his weapon. He readily consents to the merge, which successfully bestows upon his weapon the ice therapy ability, granting him a modest health restoration with each hit. Despite the initial skepticism over the minimal recovery rate, Ran acknowledges the utility of even slight regeneration, optimistic about the potential for future enhancements to this skill. After spending considerable time within the dungeon, Ran prepares to depart. The system signals the availability of an exit, requiring him to wait momentarily. Emerging through a vast portal, bystanders are taken aback by his unscathed appearance. Ran is confronted with inquiries and speculation about his condition and the presence of the League members in the vicinity. He ponders the possibility of an incident, given the unexpected injuries observed despite the dungeon's known low difficulty. Ran's attention is drawn to a commotion as an individual emerges, seeking assistance. Approaching an injured girl, he offers his apologies and inquires about the events that transpired. The girl reveals that her team was engaged in practicing newly acquired abilities when an anomalous cloud of black smoke materialized, indicating a sudden and mysterious disturbance. Upon hearing the girl's account, Ran pieces together the sequence of events, the team's sudden encounter with a mysterious cloud of black smoke and the abrupt transformation of docile monsters into formidable adversaries led to a chaotic retreat. The girl's injury, a result of haste and confusion, underscores the gravity of their predicament. The group's automatic extraction from the dungeon, triggered by a time limit breach, likely spared them from worse fates. Reflecting on the timeline, Ran connects the anomaly's occurrence with his entry into the dungeon, pondering whether his actions inadvertently escalated the dangers faced by others within the same environment. This revelation prompts him to consider the broader implications of his presence and the potential need for increased vigilance to prevent unintended consequences for fellow adventurers. As the renowned Huangtu Guild arrived to manage the dungeon anomaly, their presence signaled a swift response to the crisis. With their healers attending to the injured and their warriors gearing up for investigation, the guild's reputation for competence and authority was evident. Amidst this, Songran, having no involvement in the dungeon's peculiar transformation, opted to distance himself from the unfolding situation. His departure, however, was interrupted by two hunters who had earlier disparaged him. Their continued taunts and derision, aimed at Songran's solitary status and past misfortunes, underscored their intent to demean. Songran, preferring to avoid conflict, attempted to leave, but his dismissive response only intensified their hostility. The situation escalated when one hunter insensitively invoked the memory of Songran's late caretaker, crossing a line that prompted Songran to draw his sword in a display of defiance. So with his patience exhausted, He stood his ground, demanding an apology and making it clear that he would not tolerate further disrespect. The unexpected agility displayed by Songran, a healer by class, caught the female hunter off guard, challenging the stereotype of healers' lack of speed. In the nick of time, Wan, the leader of the Huangtu Guild, stepped in to halt Songran's retaliation against the guild member. The guild's strict policy against conflict, especially within the novice area, was emphatically reiterated by Chuan. Recognizing the hunter's diamond level status, Songran wisely decided to avoid further escalation and prepared to depart. However, before he could leave, Wan Sai, intrigued by Songran's resolve and abilities, proposed a duel in the hunter arena. This challenge presented an opportunity for Songran to prove his worth in a regulated environment, underlining the competitive spirit and honor among hunters. With a steely resolve and an unwavering gaze, Songran accepted the challenge, setting aside the earlier confrontation with the female hunter. He made his way to the Hunter League Arena, a venue designated for combat between hunters, accompanied by two other hunters. This arena was known for hosting matches under two distinct formats: friendly matches, which were non-lethal, and matches to the death, where the battle would only conclude upon the demise of one participant. Upon entering the arena, the two accompanying hunters, underestimating Songran, sneered at what they perceived as his apprehensive and timid appearance. Their derision was aimed at unsettling Songran, attempting to undermine his confidence before the impending duel. Maintaining composure amidst the provocations, Songran chose silence over retaliation. When it came time to select the nature of the match, the female hunter opted for a friendly duel, aiming to impart a lesson to Songran. Contrary to expectations, Songran boldly elected for a fight to the death, a choice that left the arena manager and spectators taken aback. The female hunter openly questioned his resolve, implying a willingness to risk his life was foolhardy. Unfazed, Songran presented the requisite documentation for participation in the deathmatch mode, solidifying his intent and surprising onlookers with his determination. The atmosphere brimmed with anticipation for the forthcoming clash, transforming the skepticism of many into intrigue. The initial doubters who had mocked Songran's demeanor were now rendered speechless, resorting to unfounded accusations of him having illicitly obtained the credentials for such a perilous undertaking. Unperturbed by the unfounded allegations, Songran confidently stood his ground, meeting all prerequisites for the duel. The buzz surrounding the imminent match swiftly permeated the hunter community, magnetizing a throng to the arena with the promise of an exceptional showdown. Songran, known for his healing prowess, was poised against Meili, an undefeated assassin with a formidable record. The stark contrast between their track records only heightened the spectators' anticipation for what appeared to be a David versus Goliath encounter. As the battle drew near, Tang Selbai, a fellow hunter, was tasked with broadcasting the event live, adding a modern twist to the age-old spectacle of arena combat. The focus returned to the arena, where Songran and Meili were on the brink of confrontation. Meili initiated the attack with astonishing velocity, yet Songran, undisturbed, greeted the onslaught with a serene smile. When Meili executed a stealthy backstab maneuver, Songran's adept evasion left the audience in awe, marveling at his ability to sidestep such a swift and surreptitious assault. In response to Meili's aggressive tactics, Songran playfully remarked on her speed, likening it to that of a sluggish snail, which only fueled her fury. Unfazed by her escalated assaults, Songran showcased not only resilience but also superior control over mana, effectively managing the pace and flow of the battle. Meili, grappling with the reality of Songran's unexpected prowess, began to question the authenticity of his purported bronze tier status, suspecting hidden depths to his abilities. In a strategic move, Meili deployed a blood fog technique, a clan-specific skill meant to obscure vision and maximize her combat efficiency. However, Songran, utilizing his fox style and the petrification ability of his evolution blade, ingeniously dissipated the fog, revealing his strategic positioning behind Meili all along. His swift and precise maneuvers left Meili disoriented, ultimately leading to her downfall as she succumbed to the ground, wounded and defeated by Songran's unexpected dominance. The spectators were utterly astounded by the turn of events in the arena. The prevailing narrative of Songran as a cursed and ostensibly frail healer-type hunter was shattered as he triumphed over an assassin in combat. With his blade poised at Meili's throat, perceptions of Songran shifted. To some, he appeared merciless, yet Meili recognized his restraint, understanding he spared her life intentionally. Songran's parting words to Meili underscored a lesson in humility and consequence, emphasizing the needless escalation that led to their confrontation. Following this unexpected victory, Songran acquired a new skill, marking a significant evolution in his journey as a hunter. The members of the Huangtu Guild, witnesses to this surprising outcome, were left to reconsider their initial assessments of Songran's capabilities and the true extent of his strength. The Huangtu Guild members, along with the broader audience watching live across the city, were astounded as the broadcast showed their esteemed assassin conceding defeat to a novice healer-type hunter. This unprecedented outcome upended expectations, captivating viewers with the sheer unpredictability of the match's conclusion. The arena buzzed with anticipation and fervor, with many voices urging Songgran to deliver a final blow to Meili. However, Songgran sought a different form of victory. He demanded an apology and recognition of fault from Meili, which she provided under the intense gaze of the livestream cameras. This moment of submission from Meili under Songgran's insistence was not just a personal victory for him, but a public spectacle that challenged the conventional hierarchy and roles within the hunter community. The event, captured and broadcasted for all to see, served as a stark reminder of the unpredictable nature of strength and honor in the arena. Following Songgran's unexpected triumph, the hunters within the guild perceived his victory as a beacon of hope, suggesting a potential resurgence to their former prominence. Songgran's success catalyzed a newfound admiration among his peers, positioning him as an emerging icon within the hunter community. As he navigated his way home, Songgran pondered the forthcoming response from the Huangtu Guild, recognizing the inevitable challenges that awaited him. Despite the anticipation of these challenges, his resolve to strengthen himself remained unwavering, driven by a clear vision of the confrontations that lay ahead. Meanwhile, the atmosphere within the Huangtu Guild was tense as the guild leader subjected Meili to punitive measures for her defeat, viewing it as a tarnish on the guild's esteemed reputation. Amid this tense scenario, an individual known as Mr. Traitor made a bold proposition to acquire Meili, sparking outrage among her comrades. However, when one of Meili's allies attempted to retaliate, Mr. Traitor showcased his formidable strength with a singular, effortless action that subdued the aggressor, underscoring his formidable presence and leaving a lasting impression on those who witnessed the encounter. The chairman of the Huangtu Guild, faced with the menacing aura of Mr. Traitor, extended an apology for the misconduct of his members and acquiesced to the demand to transfer Meili into Mr. Traitor's custody. Even the chairman felt apprehension in Mr. Traitor's presence, acknowledging the gravity of refusing his requests. Traitor, taking Meili under his control, vanished as mysteriously as he had appeared, leaving the guild leadership in contemplation over his motives and the significance of choosing Meili. Mr. Traitor, notorious in the darker circles as a figure involved in human trafficking, and known for his ruthlessness, commanded the submission of the Huangtu Guild's boss under the threat of dire repercussions. This encounter led to the departure of two principal hunters from the Huangtu Guild's ranks. The guild's boss, troubled by Songgran's disruptive influence, marked him for elimination, viewing him as a substantial threat to their operation. Amidst an ominous, stormy backdrop, Mr. Traitor transported Meili to a clandestine location. Utilizing a transformation stone on her, he observed its transformative effects with great interest, hinting at a deeper, undisclosed agenda behind his actions. The mysterious nature of Mr. Traitor and the implications of his deeds cast a shadow over the events unfolding within the guilds and the broader hunter community. In an effort to shed his former identity as a perceived underdog, Songgran made the symbolic gesture of cutting his hair, marking a new chapter in his journey. Mysteriously, a peculiar stone materialized in his presence, hinting at a possible connection to Mr. Traitor and suggesting that unseen forces were at play in shaping his destiny. Seeking to quantify his progress, Songgran visited the Hunter Association to evaluate his strength level. Despite numerous attempts and the hopes of many, he displayed no apparent awakening of his latent powers. The recommendation to utilize an awakening stone from the Troll Mine, known for its potency in unlocking one's abilities, presented Songgran with a new challenge. Given the rarity and value of such a stone, coupled with the perilous journey to the mine, forming a reliable team became imperative. Confronted with the daunting task ahead and mindful of the potential repercussions his actions could have on the dynamics of dungeon environments, Songgran grappled with concerns over endangering fellow adventurers. This awareness of the broader impact of his quest underscored the complexity of his pursuit for power and the responsibility it entailed. While contemplating his next steps, Songgran was approached by Selby, the live streamer behind his newfound recognition in the hunter community. She offered to join him on his quest to the Troll Mine, a conversation that drew the attention of surrounding hunters and hunter department staff. Amidst the sudden influx of admirers seeking photographs, Songgran, feeling besieged, hastily retreated with Selby to a quieter space. In private, Songgran shared his concerns about losing his anonymity and the unintended consequences of Selby's broadcast, particularly drawing unwanted attention from the Huangtu Guild. He then outlined his terms for partnering with Selby on the expedition to the mine. Sole ownership of any awakening stones they discovered and a strict limitation on their party size to just the two of them. Despite the inherent risks of such a minimal group, Songgran was adamant, ready to forgo the venture if Selby hesitated. Bound by directives from her guild manager and despite her apprehensions about the peril of their undertaking, Selby acquiesced to Songgrand's stipulations. Her agreement to these terms set the stage for their collaborative journey into the dungeon, underscoring the weight of the challenges they would soon face together. Upon reaching the entrance of the Trollmind dungeon, Selby suggested they deal armor for protection. Songgrand, however, chose to proceed without it, advising Selby to suit up only if she felt the need. Unfazed, they both ventured into the dungeon, where Songgrand showcased his prowess by swiftly eliminating the monsters that ambushed them. His actions not only demonstrated his formidable strength, but also inspired Selby, who summoned her beast to contribute to the fray. As they delved deeper, Songgrand's capability to dispatch adversaries with ease was evident, his strength level escalating with each victory. Despite his classification as a monster silver level hunter, he encountered no significant resistance from the dungeon's inhabitants. The anticipated evolution mode, a source of potential difficulty, remained absent, facilitating their advance through the mine. Selby, eager to participate alongside Songgrand, prepared to engage, but Songgrand assured her that the immediate threat had been neutralized. All monsters in their vicinity had been defeated. This efficient teamwork underscored Songgrand's leadership and combat effectiveness, setting a precedent for their expedition into the dungeon. Selby expressed concerns about the dungeon bosses, emphasizing their design for teams rather than solo hunters. Unfazed, Songgrand suggested they proceed and see for themselves. Approaching the final boss room, they encountered two guardian monsters on high alert. Songgrand assigned Selby the task of handling these guardians, inadvertently sparking her determination to showcase her capabilities. Embracing the challenge, Selby launched into action, transforming into a formidable wolf creature. With her enhanced strength and agility, she swiftly overcame the guardian's defenses. The guardians struggled in vain against her assault, their protective measures crumbling under her relentless onslaught. Before Selby could even process the fight's progression, one guardian had already fallen, testament to her overwhelming power and resolve. Despite Songgrand's bronze rank, his combat capabilities had soared to level 37, a feat synonymous with a gold-tier hunter. This revelation left Selby in disbelief, questioning the disparity between Songgrand's official rank and his actual prowess. Songgrand, however, remained indifferent to the notion of rank promotion, prioritizing Selby's safety above all. With a firm belief in their combined strength, Songgrand led the way to the final boss room, confident in their ability to conquer whatever challenge lay ahead. As they breached the threshold of the boss chamber, they were bathed in a luminous glow. A system alert promptly informed them of the activation of the dungeon's evolution mode and the concurrent enhancement of the boss. Prepared for such an occurrence, Songgrand understood the implications of their presence catalyzing the dungeon's adaptive mechanism. They found themselves facing a dauntingly colossal monster, a sight that bewildered Selby given the dungeon's supposed difficulty level. Yet, with the evolution mode now in effect, retreat was not an option. Bracing themselves, Songgrand and Selby confronted the formidable adversary, ready to navigate the unforeseen challenges of the enhanced dungeon environment. As Doki adopted a stance of victory, Selby was both impressed and slightly bewildered by the seeming simplicity with which the battle had been concluded. Her astonishment was mirrored by Songgrand's nonchalant reaction to the monster's unexpected resurgence, a scenario he had evidently anticipated. He elucidated that his presence inherently escalates the difficulty of any dungeon he ventures into, enhancing the adversaries within to more formidable versions of themselves. This revelation prompted Songgrand to seek Selby's collaboration in overcoming the now even more challenging foe, a gesture that significantly moved her. Their exchange was abruptly interrupted by the monster's aggressive onslaught, wielding a hammer with devastating force. Songgrand's agility and tactical acumen allowed him to evade and counter this assault with precision. He targeted the monster's vulnerable points from an elevated position, hoping to exploit any weakness. However, despite his strategic approach, the monster appeared largely unaffected by Songgrand's strikes, hinting at the necessity for a revised strategy to combat this enhanced adversary effectively. Despite his strategic efforts, Songgrand found the monster's resilience astonishing. The dire situation began to sow seeds of doubt in Selby's mind about their ability to secure victory. Songgrand acknowledged the grim reality that typically only assassins or mage-type hunters possess the specialized skills required to vanquish such formidable boss monsters. Given his status as a healer-type hunter of bronze rank, they were undeniably at a disadvantage. Yet, undeterred, Songgrand initiated another assault on the monster. Unfortunately, the monster's overwhelming strength became evident when it landed a devastating blow on Darky, effectively removing him from the combat. With Darky incapacitated, the monster unleashed a fearsome roar, signaling its readiness to continue its onslaught against Songgrand and Selby. The tension escalated as they braced for the monster's next move, prepared to face the challenge head-on despite the odds stacked against them. 3 days before their challenging encounter in the dungeon, Songgrand came into possession of an enigmatic stone, Upon its absorption by his sword, the system notified him of a significant enhancement. His weapon had acquired the capabilities characteristic of an assassin-type hunter. This unexpected transformation of the Blade of Evolution into assassin mode took Songgran by surprise, adding a new layer of complexity to his skill set. As the formidable monster lunged towards them, Songgran, wielding his newly empowered sword, skillfully countered its assault. This display of prowess confirmed Songgran's proficiency in both the healer and assassin disciplines, a rare dual mastery that significantly altered the dynamics of their confrontation. Cell, by witnessing Songgran's adept handling of the situation, inquired about the source of his newfound abilities. Songgran, however, deferred her curiosity, emphasizing the urgency of their current predicament over the backstory of his capabilities, and focused on the task at hand, overcoming the monster before them. In the midst of their conversation, the monster initiated a sudden attack, but Songgran, with his exceptional agility, evaded the onslaught. Armed with his assassin's blade, Songgran launched into a dynamic side attack, propelling himself into the air with elegance. However, the monster deployed a robust defensive maneuver, generating a shield that repelled Songgran's strike, sending him tumbling to the ground. As the beast turned its attention towards Selby, Songgran swiftly recovered and intervened, slicing off one of the monster's digits in a protective counterattack. Fueled by indignation, Songgran unleashed a fierce offensive, ultimately decapitating the monster in a display of relentless determination. Despite sustaining injuries, Songgran stood resilient, instructing Selby to seek safety, prioritizing her well-being above all else. Facing the monster's formidable charge, Songgran adeptly maneuvered out of harm's way, executing a strategic counter. His relentless assault, marked by precision and strength, overwhelmed the monster's defenses. Songgran's final, powerful strike to the monster's cranium inflicted excruciating pain, signaling the end of the confrontation. As the monster dissipated, Songgran stood triumphant, having vanquished the formidable challenge of the Troll Mine Dungeon, a testament to his unparalleled prowess and courage. Selby observed Songgran's remarkable display of strength with awe, noting his exceptional capability to rival a gold-level hunter, even without deploying his healing abilities. Their mission at the Troll Mine was a resounding success, with Songgran emerging victorious. As they had agreed earlier, Songgran approached the recuperating Selby to administer healing. However, the atmosphere shifted unexpectedly as Songgran drew his assassin's blade and aimed it at Selby, sparking a moment of tension. Selby's initial outrage at the perceived threat was quickly tempered by the realization of their disparity in combat prowess. Songgran, in a gesture of peace, sheathed his sword, prompting a moment of reflection. He inquired about Selby's motives for broadcasting their battle and accompanying him into the perilous depths of the dungeon. It was then that Selby disclosed her genuine objective: to extend an invitation to Songgran to join the Clover Guild, revealing the strategic underpinnings of her actions. 2 years prior, the Clover Guild stood as the pinnacle of excellence among guilds, led by an alpha-level hunter renowned for unparalleled prowess. This era of dominance was abruptly halted when a cataclysmic monster assault devastated the human realm, introducing a formidable boss whose strength overwhelmed the guild's elite. In a valiant solo confrontation, the guild leader managed to fend off the monster, averting total ruin for the Clover Guild. Tragically, this act of heroism resulted in the loss of the guild's elite members, leaving the leader as the sole survivor. In the aftermath, the Clover Guild faced a stark decline, gradually fading from the collective memory of the inter-association. The current ambition of the guild is to scout and cultivate hunters who possess the latent capacity to ascend to alpha-level status, with the vision of resurrecting the Clover Guild to its former glory. Within this strategic framework, Songgran is identified as a prime candidate. Despite not currently holding an alpha rank, the Clover Guild sees in him the potential to rise as a king-class hunter. Songgran's decision regarding Selby's proposal to join the Clover Guild remains pending, as he contemplates the path that lies ahead. After the dungeon's trials, Songgran, believing himself to be a harbinger of misfortune, solemnly entrusted the Awakening Stone to Selby with a stern admonition to cease her efforts to locate him again. With that, he withdrew from the vicinity, leaving a cloud of unresolved sentiments in his wake. The narrative transitions to the interior of a vehicle, where the leader of the Clover Guild, a distinguished female hunter, received intelligence on the Troll Mine Dungeon's conquest at the hands of Songgran. Perceiving this development as an auspicious moment, she recognized the potential for a direct dialogue with Songgran. This revelation sparked her interest, considering it an opportune moment to personally engage with him and discuss the future, highlighting the significance of Songgran's recent achievements and their potential impact on the guild's aspirations. In the days following his departure from Selby, Songgran dedicated himself to conquering multiple dungeons, marking substantial achievements. However, he observed a peculiar trend: his experience points XP accumulated at a regular pace. but his progression to higher levels decelerated the more XP he acquired. Despite this anomaly, Songgran remained satisfied with the accumulation of his XP. Grassi led Songgran to examine the Awakening Stone he had secured from the Troll Mine, contemplating the potential skill it might unveil. To his delight, the stone bestowed upon him a new skill, Cult Scythe Heal. This skill represented a significant enhancement to his healing capabilities. Given his self-assessed modest proficiency in healing, Songgran was initially uncertain about the practical utility of this newfound ability. As he mulled over the implications of Cult Scythe Heal, an unexpected knock on his door disrupted the quiet of the night, prompting Songgran to confront the mystery awaiting him on the other side. Songgran's peaceful evening was disrupted by an unexpected intrusion from members of the Hunter Association, who entered his home without consent. Their presence was predicated on suspicions arising from Songgran and Selby's completion of the Troll Mines, a feat they deemed improbable for a duo, given the dungeon's design for a team of five. Amid Songgran's apprehension about the nature of their investigation, Zhao Jingyan, the leader of the Clover Guild, made her appearance, adding gravity to the unfolding scenario within Songgran's residence. Songgran, seeking clarity, queried the hunters about their intentions, half expecting their concerns to stem from historical events such as the hunter massacre or the peculiar alterations within dungeons he had previously explored. Contrary to his speculations, the visit bore an entirely different purpose. The Hunter Association extended an offer to recruit Songgran, promising to unveil the obscured circumstances surrounding his mother's demise, a mystery that had long eluded him and served as the catalyst for his pursuit of becoming a hunter. Zhao Jingyan explained to Songgran that the full scope of information regarding his mother's mysterious demise was currently beyond his reach, citing his insufficient accumulation of hunter points as the primary barrier. These points, pivotal within the Hunter Association's hierarchy, gatekeep crucial data, including the secrets surrounding his mother's death. She proposed an opportunity for Songgran to accrue the necessary points through participation in the forthcoming Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon event, hinting at its significance in unveiling the concealed truths about his lineage. Encouraged by Jingyan's counsel to update his hunter ranking, which was intricately linked to the enigma of his mother's fate, Songgran resolved to align with the Hunter Association's objectives and venture into the seasonal dungeon. Meanwhile, at the Clover Guild headquarters, Jingyan expressed her appreciation for Selby's insights into Songran's exploits within the Troll Mine. Acknowledging his latent capacity for reaching Alpha Rank status, the guild strategized to closely monitor his progression. They envisioned Songgran as a pivotal figure in spearheading the guild's resurgence, signifying their vested interest in nurturing his development towards becoming a linchpin in their collective aspiration for revival. Jingyan briefed Selby on the forthcoming seasonal dungeon, a topic Selby acknowledged with understanding. Transitioning to the Hunter Association office, Songgran opted for a disguise to maintain anonymity while proceeding to elevate his hunter rank. His journey led him to the evaluation room, unexpectedly staffed by the head of the Clover Guild. Songgran was informed of an impending meeting during his rank update. Upon entering the designated room, he encountered Byron, known in darker circles as Mr. Traitor, who expressed a long-standing anticipation for this encounter. The atmosphere tensed as Mr. Traitor nonchalantly disposed of his cigarette ashtray, initiating an unanticipated assault. Songgran, equipped with his honed reflexes and combat skills, managed to resist and counter Mr. Traitor's formidable strike. The impact was so intense that it punctured a hole in the wall, leaving onlookers astounded by the display of power. Fascinated by the encounter, Songgran inquired about Mr. Traitor's identity and his intentions. Mr. Traitor revealed his purpose as a test of Songran's capabilities, showcasing his exceptional power of levitation, which grants him mastery over the wind. Songgran, witnessing his strikes merely impacting stone, voiced his skepticism regarding Mr. Traitor's claim of judgment. Undeterred and seeking clarity, Songgran launched into action with swift, lightning-like maneuvers aimed at Mr. Traitor, demonstrating his resolve to confront and understand the true nature of this unexpected challenge. Navigating through the debris, Songgran approached Mr. Traitor, clarifying his reluctance to inflict harm and expressing his desire for an elucidation. Mr. Traitor, with a bemused chuckle, questioned Songran's confidence in his ability to cause him any harm. Confronting Mr. Traitor directly, Songgran executed a formidable technique, the balanced blade, initiating a clash that highlighted the disparity in their strengths. Despite the potency of Songran's assault, Traitor effortlessly countered, neutralizing the attack with a mere flick of his finger, showcasing a profound level of mastery and control. Mr. Traitor delivered a stern warning to Songran about the unforgiving nature of their world, cautioning him against overconfidence and the perils it harbors. In a sudden display of force, Mr. Traitor kick sent Songgran reeling, causing him to lose his balance and crash to the ground. Attempting to regain composure, Songgran was enveloped by a dense fog, obscuring his vision and disorienting him. Once the smoke dissipated, he found himself bewildered on the rooftop of the Hunter Association building, puzzled over the mysterious transition and how he ended up there without any recollection of the journey. Resuming their tense exchange, Mr. Trader highlighted the vast disparity in their power levels, boasting of his ability to defy gravity and challenge Song Ran to withstand just one of his formidable attacks. In return, he teased the possibility of conceding his title to Song Ran. Undaunted by Mr. Trader's derisive comments, Song Ran's resolve only hardened. Summoning his inner strength, he engaged his assassin mode alongside the Siphon Heal ability, effectively boosting his physical capabilities, agility, and resilience. Faced with daunting opposition, Song Ran's spirit remained unbroken, ready to confront the challenge head-on without any thoughts of surrender. Witnessing Song Ran's escalation in power, Mr. Trader appeared taken aback. In response, he executed his formidable tornado towering technique, summoning the fury of a thunderstorm, a spectacle that momentarily transformed the skyline. Amid this tumultuous display, a separate powerful explosion startled the city, its origins shrouded in mystery and unrelated to Mr. Trader's tempestuous display. Following this dramatic demonstration, Mr. Trader gracefully descended back onto the rooftop, concluding their intense encounter. He acknowledged Song Ran's resilience and skill, granting him a pass in this unexpected test. Song Ran, bewildered by the outcome, listened as Mr. Trader explained that their confrontation was not a battle for rank, but rather an exhibition of Song Ran's potential and mettle. Declaring his disinterest in frivolous activities and his urgency to focus on more pressing matters, Song Ran was suddenly interrupted by a deafening explosion that reverberated throughout the city. This disturbance was traced to the emergence of a colossal dungeon portal in the urban core, an event eerily reminiscent of a catastrophic incident that had occurred 50 years prior. In response to this unprecedented event, the Team G notification hall was thrown into high alert, with alarms sounding and red lights flashing across monitors. The Hunter Association's rapid response team swiftly pinpointed the location of the portal and initiated communications with nearby hunters, mobilizing them to address the crisis. Chief Cell, the chief investigator, received immediate notification about the dungeon portal's appearance, underscoring the gravity of the situation and the imminent threat it posed to the city's safety. From their vantage point atop the building, Mr. Trader and Song Ran observed the unfolding chaos brought about by the portal's sudden appearance. Mr. Trader shared his apprehensions, musing on the portal's premature emergence, pondering whether it was the result of a detection anomaly or an unforeseen shift in the usual patterns. Despite the readiness of Alpha-level hunters, their current engagement with a formidable Gray Gate within another dungeon left them unavailable to address this new threat. Recognizing Song Ran's significant progress and burgeoning strength, Trader conveyed his belief that Song Ran was now adequately prepared to tackle the challenges of the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon, suggesting a pivotal moment in Song Ran's journey as a hunter. Mr. Trader proposed a plan to escort Song Ran to the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon via a special portal located on the third floor of the Hunter Association lobby, which leads directly to the Sky Tower. He shared with Song Ran that the determination of his hunter rank would hinge on the highest floor he could navigate within the tower. Amid their discussion, Song Ran's device buzzed with an urgent notification, alerting him to a monster invasion unfolding in the city center. The message outlined a reward system for hunters participating in the defense, with the compensation directly correlating to the quantity of monsters each hunter successfully eliminates. This unexpected call to action presented Song Ran with a critical decision to make in the face of the city's dire circumstances. While tuning into a live broadcast of the chaos unfolding in the city center, Song Ran spotted Selby engaged in combat alongside other hunters. Contrary to Mr. Trader's assumption that Song Ran's motivation was concern for Selby, Song Ran clarified his intention to participate was driven by the pursuit of hunter points. Compelled to contribute to the defense efforts, Song Ran hastened towards the epicenter of the turmoil to support Selby and combat the invading monsters. The city was engulfed in disorder as creatures from the dungeon portal launched their assault, causing widespread destruction. Hunters, Song Ran included, rallied with their guild members, ready to confront the menace and restore peace to the beleaguered city. Navigating through the chaos, Song Ran moved swiftly amidst the frenzy of fleeing citizens, his focus set on confronting the monstrous threat. Encountering a formidable beast, he summoned the power of his assassin mode sword, ready for battle amidst the clash. His attention was caught by a distressing scene, a young girl clutching a doll visible through a window of a nearby building. Tragedy struck as the building crumbled under the monster's might, sending the child plummeting towards danger. Her cries pierced the turmoil, leaving Song Ran in a harrowing predicament, torn between the call of battle and a deep-seated urge to protect the innocent. In a breathtaking moment of heroism, Darky emerged, leaping through the air to catch the falling child, ensuring a safe landing. This act of valor highlighted Darky's remarkable agility and courage. Reunited with Sellbai amidst the fray, Songran's immediate concern was for his comrade's well-being, asking after Sellbai's condition. It was a moment that underscored Songran's care for those around him, even in the midst of an escalating crisis. Sellbai revealed her minor injuries from the previous encounter, prompting Songran to swiftly apply his healing abilities to her wounds. Touched by his act of kindness, Sellbai couldn't help but blush, explaining that despite the presence of several elite hunters, the monster's formidable defenses had left them all at a stalemate. They were stumped on how to breach the protective shield encasing their formidable adversary. In this tense moment, an audacious motorcyclist charged at the beast with remarkable speed. Seizing the moment, Songran, alongside Darky and Sellbai, plunged into the fray. They confronted the gigantic monster, only to discover its guardian shield rendered their concerted attacks futile, a testament to the creature's formidable defense mechanisms. The motorcyclist executed a daring maneuver through the air, delivering a forceful double strike upon the monster. He persisted in his offensive, vaulting over the creature's back, only for his motorcycle to crash and erupt in flames upon impact with the ground. Despite his valiant efforts, the monster, shielded by its guardian, remained unscathed. Undeterred by the motorcyclist's fate, Songran and Darky prepared for their own assault. With a concerted leap, they propelled themselves skyward, aiming to target the monster's vulnerable rear. Darky provided an essential boost, enabling Songran to surge forward with increased momentum towards their formidable foe. Amidst the battle, the red-haired hunter persisted in his assault on the monster's lower extremities. When Songran positioned himself directly before the colossal beast, he unleashed a ferocious swing of his sword. Initially, the barrier seemed impenetrable. Yet, after a meticulous examination, Songran identified a vulnerability within the barrier's defenses. With a decisive and powerful thrust, his sword breached the protective shield. This breakthrough caused a significant wound to the monster, triggering it into a wild frenzy. As the creature thrashed in pain, its protective barrier disintegrated, ejecting Songran and the remnants of the shattered barrier into the surrounding chaos. Sellbai swiftly intervened to prevent a fall from a significant height, securing Songran's safety with a barrier. This event left the other hunters astonished as their efforts to break the barrier had previously failed. Yet Songran had achieved what they could not. The red-haired hunter then coordinated with another to escalate their attack, employing their strongest skills to overcome the monster amidst the spectators. Despite the red-haired hunter's false claim of shattering the monster's barrier, the audience recognized Songran's pivotal role in the victory. This development frustrated the red-haired hunter as Songran's success diminished his own recognition. Subsequently, a new hunter, Suku, emerged wielding the formidable quantum cannon. As a member of the Huang Tu Guild, she harbored resentment towards Songran, attributing her brother's demise in a standard-level dungeon under his leadership to his negligence. Suku held Songran responsible for her brother's demise, despite him being the lone survivor of that tragic event. She later aligned herself with the Huang Tu Guild, which was dedicated to opposing Songran, arriving to support the hunters against the monstrous incursions. She was unaware that Songran was in close proximity. Their confrontation with the giant creatures was hindered by a resilient barrier, similar to the earlier encounter which neutralized their efforts. The creatures, intent on accumulating hunter points, would rise after defeat. Suku's attempts to penetrate the barrier with her quantum cannon were futile, as only Songran's formidable power could breach it. The collective of hunters implored Songran to intervene and dismantle the barrier once again. Accompanied by Donkey, Songran advanced towards the creature. A hunter, gifted in healing, enhanced Songran's capabilities, amplifying his strength with a significant mana aura. This synergy of the hunter's enhancement and Songran's assassin proficiency allowed him to approach the monster with increased vigor. Songran's empowered strikes eventually ruptured the creature's defenses, granting him the phantom skill, which enabled him to transform into a shadow and dodge any approaching threats. Drawing his sword, Songran activated his newly acquired phantom skill and propelled himself onto the beast, continuing their confrontation. Alongside Donkey, they embarked on a mission to defeat a formidable monster. Their efforts were bolstered by an additional hunter, skilled in healing, who enhanced Songran's strength. The collective power of their abilities enveloped Songran in a radiant mana aura, significantly amplifying his might. Upon activating the phantom skill, Songran morphed into a translucent, shadowy figure, rendering the monster's attacks ineffective as they passed harmlessly through him. This newfound ability not only made him impervious to physical harm, but also granted him the capability to manipulate gravity, allowing for aerial maneuvers previously beyond his reach. This significant enhancement bolstered Songran's confidence as he geared up for the forthcoming stage of the confrontation, resolute in his solo endeavor to vanquish the creature. Utilizing his phantom ability for both evasion and assault, Songran soared through the air, sword in hand, targeting the monster. The spectacle of Songran's prowess stirred a sense of envy in a red-haired hunter, who recognize the tactical advantage provided by the collective strength and skills of fellow hunters. Determined not to be overshadowed, the red-haired hunter advanced with his signature drag sword technique. The sudden deployment of a powerful quantum cannon by the hunter caught Songran off guard, setting the stage for a fierce rivalry over who would claim the monster's defeat. In tandem with Suku's formidable cannon, the duo launched a relentless onslaught against the creature, subjecting it to severe distress. As the monster displayed signs of vulnerability, targeted at its critical points, the observing hunters mobilized, uniting their efforts to subdue the creature. Yet, the monster's sudden frenzy presented an overwhelming challenge, particularly threatening Suku as it advanced. The trio found themselves encircled by adversaries, their situation dire. In a pivotal moment, Songran, harnessing his phantom ability, merged with the monster, wielding his sword with unparalleled agility and precision. In this encounter, Songran's unique sword mode, capable of healing, allowed him to deal significant damage. His dual capabilities as a hunter, blending healing and assassin skills, astonished his fellow hunters. Demonstrating his tactical ingenuity, Songran petrified and severed a limb of the monster, effectively neutralizing it. This strategic move critically weakened the beast, spurring the hunters to intensify their assault, driven by the prospect of victory. The climax of the battle saw the hunters deploying their collective might, showcasing an array of skills and powers against the weakened monster. This concerted action signified the culmination of their struggle as they aimed to vanquish the monster conclusively. In his phantom form, Songran infiltrates the monster's body, dealing substantial damage with his healing mode sword. The rest of the hunters amplify the onslaught, culminating in Songran striking the decisive blow, vanquishing the beast and securing 164 hunter points and an abundance of XP. The triumph elicits a wave of celebration and jubilation among the hunters. Yet, amidst the festivities, the red-haired hunter identified as the team's leader seeks a private conversation with Songran, concurrently Suku. Recognizing Songran as the victor, approaches with intentions fueled by vengeance for her brother's demise. Confronted by Suku, Songran stands prepared for her grievance, driven by the loss she attributes to him. Despite Selby's effort to shield Songran, Suku's resolve remains unyielding, threatening any who would obstruct her path. When Songran reveals his identity, removing his disguise, Suku identifies him as the ill-fated hunter linked to her brother's and his team's tragic end. Songran finds himself ensnared in silence, burdened by the weight of misconceptions and unfounded accusations that cast him as the harbinger of misfortune. Amidst the tension, Songran extended an apology to Suku, assuming responsibility for the discord. However, as Suku was about to retaliate, the team leader intervened, preventing harm to Songran by intercepting a bullet directed at him. Subsequently, the chairman disclosed the formation of an alliance aimed at overcoming the monster, announcing Songran's inclusion in their ranks. As the group processed this information, an urgent development occurred. A jeep from the Hunter Association arrived, dispatched on a critical mission to evacuate the hunters from the vicinity. The driver conveyed a dire warning about the imminent arrival of more formidable monsters and the emergence of a hazardous portal in their location. This revelation prompted inquiries from a hunter, unfamiliar with the significance of these portals to their mission. In response, another hunter, aware of the gravity of the situation, urged immediate evacuation, highlighting the portals as a significant threat to their safety. Unexpectedly, the supposedly vanquished monster revived, gesturing ominously towards its abdomen. The narrative then transitions to a formidable figure, presumably the monarch of the invading monsters, seated authoritatively on a throne. The narrative shifts back to the town's heart, where it's revealed that the previously defeated monster had utilized its remaining energy to disintegrate into ashes, simultaneously activating a portal. The hunters were engulfed in disbelief and silence as the portal manifested, threatening to draw in everything nearby, reminiscent of an event that occurred 50 years ago. Despite its altered appearance, the portal swiftly enveloped them all before they could react. They emerged in a mysterious dungeon known as the Forgotten Sea, a stark contrast to their previous location. Meanwhile, Songran's whereabouts remained uncertain until a system notification confirmed the successful portal transition. At this juncture, a woman named Doris materialized, offering her guidance to Songran. It was revealed that Songran had been rerouted to a realm called the Sky Portal, finding himself within the confines of the Sky Tower. Songran inquired of Doris about his solitary presence in the Sky Tower, contrasting with the location of other hunters. Doris clarified that the others were probably navigating the Forgotten Sea, emphasizing Songran's unique status, which warranted his assignment to the Sky Tower. Doris' awareness of Songran's quest to unravel the mystery of his mother's demise, along with her knowledge of his life narrative, took Songran by surprise. Puzzled by the extent of Doris's insight, Songran questioned her source of information. Doris revealed that Songran's exceptional status as an awakened hunter, surpassing the strength of his peers, was the reason for his exclusive summoning to the Sky Tower. Despite Songren's desire to unite with his comrades in the Forgotten Sea, Doris recommended against it, suggesting that his presence could pose a risk to them and potentially alter the dungeon's dynamics. Upon reaching the entrance of the Sky Tower, Songren and Doris witnessed its transformation. The sky shifted to a foreboding red hue, indicating the escalation and challenge within the Forgotten Sea. Despite Selby's efforts, Songren remained elusive, and fellow hunters reported her absence as well. In an unexpected development, a representative from the Hunters Association declared the emergence of the initial group of bosses. Accompanied by a violent wind, a yellow haze enveloped the area, carrying rocks and creating a sandstorm-like environment. From this tumultuous mist, the formidable entity known as the God of the Sand and Sea made its appearance. The Keeper of the Storm Door, wielding his book and staff, proclaimed the deity's intent to judge humanity for its environmental transgressions. As the sandstorm grew more severe, the situation for the hunters became increasingly perilous. The team's leader boldly stepped forward, ready to engage the creature, and advised his team to observe his tactics closely. The entity, sensing the impending assault, unleashed a powerful skill, marking the commencement of its judgment upon them. In a parallel scene, Songren was navigating the challenges of the Sky Tower, having reached the ninth floor with relative ease, initially underestimating the complexity of the Sky Tower. He soon recognized the increasing difficulty that awaited him on the subsequent levels, adjusting his expectations for the challenges ahead. Upon entering the tower, Songren was mindful of the rule stating that a boss monster would guard every 10th floor, with each defeat providing increasingly valuable rewards. Filled with anticipation, he stepped through the portal leading to the first 10th floor, ready to confront the awaiting boss monster. To his surprise, he was greeted by the monster, which astonishingly spoke in human language, expressing amazement at Songren's arrival to accept the challenge. The monster, revealing its formidable size and strength, drew its sword and launched an attack. Songren, however, swiftly activated his phantom skill, transforming into a shadow to dodge the attack effortlessly. The monster, caught off guard by Songren's agility and tactical prowess, found him repositioned and prepared to counterattack with his assassin's blade. Though Songren inflicted damage on the monster, it quickly recovered and launched a formidable chi blast, effortlessly knocking Songren back. This encounter revealed the monster's dual affinity for fire and berserk elements, classifying it as a berserk-type boss. Songren was momentarily overawed by the monster's formidable display of strength. Despite being struck by the monster's potent attack, Songren remained composed, countering the monster's taunts by expressing his disappointment, comparing it unfavorably to the more formidable foes he had vanquished in the past. This retort only intensified the monster's fury. In response, Songren harnessed his Siphon Heal ability, augmenting his powers for the ongoing battle. Facing the monster's relentless assault, Songren strategically allowed himself to be hit, a decision that brought intense pain, but also set the stage for his counterattack. With his assassin mode activated and his strength amplified by Siphon Heal, Songren resolved to engage in serious combat to swiftly overcome the monster. The monster, taken aback by Songren's evident healing capabilities, grew increasingly frustrated. In a surge of rage, it launched a mighty swing of its great sword toward Songren. To the creature's astonishment, Songren not only blocked the formidable strike with his bare hands, but also managed to hold onto the blade firmly until it fractured, showcasing his extraordinary power. Songren confidently affirmed his capability to effortlessly conquer such foes henceforth. The boss monster was left in astonishment as its sword crumbled under Songren's formidable grasp. Puzzled by the destruction of his weapon, the monster's aggravation intensified. It launched an assault with its bare hands, only for Songren to decisively sever and disintegrate the attacking limb, showcasing his superior strength and leaving Songren unscathed. Revealing his strategy, Songren disclosed that his prior actions were merely an assessment of the monster's capabilities. With a strategic execution of his ultimate skill, he triumphantly vanquished the monster, claiming its head as a trophy. Disposing of the head, Songren readied himself for the ascent to the subsequent floor, undeterred and more resolved than ever. Reflecting on previous encounters, Songren recalled meeting an individual with a similar formidable strength and the same intense gaze as his own. This insight led him to a profound realization. The entities he battled were not merely demonic beings, but once humans. This revelation left a lasting impression on him. Following his triumph, Songren was awarded a precious item, capable of being integrated with his sword, enhancing its power and potential. The narrative transitions to the Hunter Association, highlighting the Flame Dragon Guild's preparation to venture into the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon alongside other hunters. The focus then shifts to the heart of the Sea of Forgetfulness, where hunters engage in an intense confrontation with the Sand Deity. Despite their efforts to breach the sandstorm's defenses, their magical assaults prove futile. The hunters are soon afflicted by a debilitating curse, manifesting as severe headaches, a consequence of the monster's spell from within the storm. Remarkably, Selby remains unaffected by this affliction. A representative from the Hunter Association elucidates that the spell is a cursed magic known as the Three Mysteries, selectively cursing half of the players and sapping their vitality. It is attributed to Thoth, the deity of wisdom from ancient Egyptian lore, underscoring the spell's mystical origins. The curse's relentless spread threatens all players with fatal consequences, unless nullified by a healing spell. The efficacy of such a spell directly correlates with its potency, enhancing the likelihood of liberating those ensnared by the curse. The hunters seek assistance from healers, who, despite their willingness, find themselves depleted of mana after confronting monsters that laid siege to the city, severely constraining their ability to cast spells. In response to this dire situation, the Hunter Association devises an alternative strategy to breach the monster's wind barrier. It calls upon formidable hunters to employ their offensive capabilities to penetrate the barrier and confront Thoth directly. A successful assault promises the dissolution of the wind wall. Confronted with the urgent need to halt the curse's proliferation, the hunters resolve to eliminate the monster. Yet the potential for deceptive illusions introduces an added layer of complexity to their mission. The sudden onset of excruciating pain in one hunter signals the curse's affliction, plunging the group into turmoil as they grapple with the stark realization that perishing within the dungeon equates to actual death. Undeterred, one hunter bravely attempts to breach the wind barrier, yet fails to penetrate it. Following this, the monster counterattacks, sending the hunter tumbling to the ground. Unexpectedly, the Hunter Association's jeep, caught within the wind's grasp, makes a daring entry. The monster, known as Thoth, is identified as the source of the turmoil. With remarkable speed, the jeep slices through the wind barrier, presenting a glimmer of hope for the rescue of the trapped hunters. The driver, wielding a sword and adept in the demon sword slash technique, fearlessly engages Thoth, swiftly vanquishing the beast. Thoth, a magic-based monster, shows vulnerability to close-quarters combat. The protective wind barrier was its only defense against a direct assault. The hunter's superior swordsmanship ensures the monster's defeat in one decisive strike. Their triumph was fleeting as the original monster reemerged, leaving the hunters astonished. Doubts arose among them, questioning if their previous victory was an illusion. The monster retaliated with a dark magic assault, manifesting as a monstrous hand. The hunter was taken aback by the strength of the monster's spell. In the nick of time, the hunter intervened, delivering a quick blow to deflect the monster's arm, causing the wand to be dislodged and sent flying. The hunter swiftly recovered the wand, tossing it to Selby to prevent the monster from reclaiming it. Upon receiving the wand, Selby experienced a flood of its memories, revealing the method to defeat the few Thoth monsters. She learned that these creatures harvest the souls of hunters to conjure dark magic illusions. Facing Thoth's illusory onslaught, Selby, armed with the enchanted wand, was poised for battle. Known as the deity of deceit and illusion, Thoth's dominion was challenged by Selby's resolve. She triumphed over the monster with her spells, marking a victory not only over Thoth but also over the primary forces in the Forgotten Sea, securing the staff of Thoth in the process. As a proficient sorceress, Selby terminated the monster's era of fear. With the monster's defeat, its dark magic vanished, allowing the incapacitated hunters to regain their strength. The team then focused on their next quest, drawn to the brilliant glow emanating from the pyramid's core, eager to achieve their ultimate aim. Meanwhile, Songran, having ascended to the Sky Tower's 50th level, opted to use his reward to replenish his mana, gearing up for the imminent confrontation with the boss monster, ready for battle once his mana was fully restored. Songran detects the presence of the boss monster, curiously resembling a human, who communicates in human language, expressing a desire for a worthy battle. This leads Songran to speculate that the Sky Tower's monsters might be under a spell, compelled to focus solely on combat. The boss monster then provocatively invites Songran to engage in combat. Abruptly, the monster is enveloped in a crimson aura, aggressively advancing towards Songran with its blade. Despite successfully evading the initial strike, Songran is plagued by doubts about his capability to overcome this adversary. The monster continues its assault without respite, yet Songran adeptly defends against its ranged abilities. The monster daringly challenges Songran to a battle to the end, intensifying the confrontation. In a rapid maneuver, the monster inflicts a wound on Songran, causing him to collapse. Mockingly, the monster declares Songran inferior to its previous adversaries. Nonetheless, Songran, driven by resilience, rises despite his injuries. Subsequently, the monster unleashes its formidable ability, Blood Prison Sure Field, conjuring numerous swords from a crimson circle to assail Songran. In retaliation, Songran activates his phantom skill, morphing into a shadow to evade the onslaught unscathed. Seizing the moment, Songran shifts into assassin mode, ambushing the monster from behind with his assassin blade, showcasing his strategic prowess in the heat of battle. The monster's invitation for Songgran to showcase his full capabilities precedes an explosion that propels him backward. Confused, Songgran contemplates the potential expiration of his phantom skills effect. The monster then removes its blindfold, unveiling numerous eyes capable of neutralizing magic. Recognizing Songgran's formidable strength, the monster admits to employing its magical eyes' power in their duel. It proceeds to execute its ultimate technique, brandishing a sword of unprecedented size. Songgran employs his phantom skills in an attempt to parry and evade the incoming strike. Despite his strategic maneuvering, he sustains severe injuries from the monster's powerful attack. In a critical moment, Songgran, fueled by desperation, declares a mutual demise and activates his ultimate skill, launching a powerful assault. This attack emits a radiant, dazzling light, breaking through the monster's formidable defenses. Songgran, with unwavering resolve, demands the monster's surrender. Songgran secures his victory as the monster gradually disintegrates, fading into oblivion. Its parting words suggest that its demonic strength was derived from the essence of nothingness. Reflected in the water below is a human-like silhouette, hinting at the monster's possible past as a human who was transformed into a guardian beast. Confronted with the enigmas of the Sky Tower, Songgran opts to retreat in spite of his achievements. Upon returning to the Sky Tower's entrance, he is greeted by Doris, who rewards him for reaching the 50th level. A system alert then announces that Songgran has accumulated the necessary XP, elevating him to platinum status. The message also informs him that he will be transported back to the human realm in mere seconds. Following his expedition in the Sky Tower, Songgran proceeds to the Hunter Association office, continuing his journey. Driven by a thirst for knowledge about the Sky Tower's secrets, Songgran is committed to conquering every level it encompasses. He suspects a link between his evolutionary sword and his mother's demise within the tower. Exiting the office, Songgran encounters an architect from a guild based in Songgran City. Shortly thereafter, the hunters venture into the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon, pausing for a well-earned respite on the Fonadu Green Continent. To their delight, they stumble upon a base camp offering sanctuary, where the local inhabitants extend a warm welcome. According to the Hunter Association, the Sky Tower houses 8 golden pyramids, each shrouded in mystery and awaiting discovery. The hunters, eager to unveil the secrets nestled within, are tasked with the daunting challenge of conquering each pyramid. Amidst their strategic planning, they are approached by the tribal leader, who shares a vital secret concerning the Sea of Sand. He cautions them that their victory over the Gadoth was merely the beginning of a more arduous journey. To triumph in the Chosen God's battle, they must not only redefeat Thoth, but also conquer 7 additional formidable monsters and deities. As a representative from the Hunters Association began to unveil the names of the divine beasts, the tribal chief interjected, asserting his exclusive insight into the Sea of Sand's mysteries. He emphasized the necessity for the hunters to brace for the challenges that awaited. The chief elucidated that each vanquished deity would signify the conquest of a pyramid, guiding them closer to the main pyramid, where ultimate victory awaited. In ancient times, the deity Ari reigned over the desert, ushering in an era of tranquility for its inhabitants. However, the congregation of the 8 supreme gods plunged Ari into a deep slumber, igniting a struggle for supremacy among them. The victor of the Chosen God's battle would ascend as the desert's new sovereign. The reward for defeating a god was not just honor, but the opportunity to contend for divine dominion. Upon learning this, Selbai contemplated the possibility of ascending to godhood herself. The struggle for dominion in the desert is perpetual, with new leaders emerging from each confrontation. The tribal chief shared his belief in Ari's eventual return to resolve the ceaseless strife. Amidst this narrative, a member from the Hunter Association interjected, clarifying their mission as merely following the association's directives to locate the 6 remaining gods, marking the commencement of the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon. Unexpectedly, Suku declared her intention to independently conquer one of the minor pyramids, surprising the assembly. Skepticism arose regarding the feasibility of a solitary individual overcoming a pyramid. Yet Suku remained steadfast in her conviction to demonstrate her capability. The association's delegate mentioned that the pyramid's difficulty would scale with the number of explorers, suggesting a more manageable challenge for smaller groups. This revelation prompted the hunter team's leader to proceed with his group towards the remaining pyramids, adapting their strategy in light of this information. Songgran was intrigued by the architect's knowledge of his return from the Sky Tower. The architect explained that he could monitor Songgran's whereabouts through a sophisticated elemental and hunter tracking system. Despite an invitation to lunch, Songgran hesitated due to his casual attire. The architect, accommodating as ever, offered Songgran suitable clothing to ensure the meeting could proceed without delay. Dressed in the provided attire, Songgran accompanied the man for their discussion. The narrative then transitions to the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon, where Yan, a red-haired hunter, ventures into a pyramid. As he navigates the dungeon, the candles spontaneously ignite, startling him. The room, reminiscent of an arena, becomes enveloped in a charge and buoyance as torches blaze to life. Suddenly, a deity of war and might sight descends, eager to prove his strength. Yaun introduces himself as the leader of the Anlong Guild, heralding a new era. The deity welcomes the challenge, pleased to encounter a formidable adversary in Yaun. Yaun commenced the duel with a maneuver known as Holy Slash, yet the monster deflected it with ease. Despite a barrage of assaults from Yaun, the adversary's formidable strength rendered each attempt futile. Yaun was astounded by the monster's formidable prowess. In retaliation, the monster unleashed a series of attacks, which Yaun withstood resiliently. Acknowledging the monster's capabilities as comparable to those of a Diamond Tier hunter, Yaun felt his abilities were being underrated and intensified his offensive, charging at the monster once more. Nevertheless, the monster thwarted his advance. The clash between Yaun and the monster escalated, each subsequent attack surpassing the previous in intensity. The turn of events astounds onlookers as the monster launches a powerful counterattack, landing an upward punch that sends Yaun reeling backward. The assault doesn't stop there. The monster lands another hit on Yan's back, propelling him through the air. The formidable strength of the mature monster leaves Yaun struggling to rise. Aware of the increased challenge in facing boss monsters without a healer, Yaun consumes a potion to rejuvenate himself and re-engages in the battle. Simultaneously, Suku enters a different pyramid, poised for combat with her cannon at the ready. Yet, she encounters an unexpected calm in the arena, prompting her to ponder over the issues concerning Songgran. Suku grapples with conflicting feelings towards Songgran, torn between viewing him as her brother's possible murderer and as a savior who once saved her life. Amidst this confusion, she is haunted by a voice that fills her with resentment towards her father, the perpetrator behind her mother's death. This internal strife inflicts profound anguish and turmoil on Suku. The tribal chief reveals that Suku's situation is perilous, as she finds herself within a lesser pyramid, the dwelling of the formidable boss monster, God Horus. Meanwhile, the narrative shifts to Songgran, engaged in a conversation with the guild architect at the association's office, though the specifics of their dialogue remain undisclosed. In the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon, the leader elaborates on the Horus Pyramid, described by Yaun as a labyrinth designed to entrap the boss monsters within, wielding a power named God Dream, excel in mental manipulation, crafting illusions that can turn allies against one another by infiltrating their minds and altering perceptions. Such deceptions have previously led hunter teams to inflict harm upon each other. Suku, manipulated by Horus, found herself unwittingly pursuing Songgran. Amidst a confusion of cars, she was struck and rendered unconscious in Songgran's presence. Within this illusion, Songgran was portrayed as the antagonist, though the reality of the situation was obscured. The focus then shifts back to the pyramid, where Yaun faces off against the monster site. As the battle draws to a close, Yaun is severely injured, his potions depleted, and the monster is poised for a final blow. It is at this critical moment that Songgran emerges as the unforeseen rescuer. Songgran made an unexpected entrance and launched an attack on the monster, sight catching Yaun off guard. Expressing gratitude for Yaun's earlier intervention, Songgran declared it his turn to return the favor and safeguard Yaun. He then activated his healing skills to address Yaun's injuries. The narrative transitions to the Hunter Association office, where Songgran is in discussion with the guild architect, Sun Wu. It comes to light that Sun Wu had orchestrated Songgran's teleportation to Yan's side. As Yaun recuperated fully, he stood up, ready to face what comes next. The duo agreed to postpone their discussion, recognizing the immediate necessity to unite their efforts against the monster, Sight. The monster deployed its most formidable attack, the Spear of War, resulting in a tremendous upheaval in their environment. Yaun encouraged Songgran, emphasizing their numerical advantage in this two-against-one scenario. Unexpectedly, the monster summoned an army of indomitable monsters, escalating the challenge. Faced with thousands of adversaries, including the fearsome Saiti, Songgran and Yanda did not waver. They leapt into action, employing their combat prowess to methodically eliminate the monsters, demonstrating their strategic and fighting skills in the face of overwhelming odds. Despite Songgran's formidable abilities, the vast numbers of skeleton beasts presented a relentless challenge. The duo realized that as long as Saiti, the final boss, was undefeated, the skeleton beast army would continue to regenerate, leaving them searching for a strategy to end the relentless onslaught. At the hunter's base camp outside the pyramids, reinforcements from various hunter guilds had converged. Yuji Yao, the leader of the Clover Guild, responded to a call from the Hunter Association. Qi Soyen, the head of the Jiangqin Guild, was also present. The Huangtu Guild arrived, led by someone harboring a vendetta against Songgran. The Huangtu Guild introduced two mercenaries with awakened abilities, among whom Xingxiu of the Royal Map Guild was identified as a particularly potent hunter. The news of these elite reinforcements belonging to the first echelon of formidable hunters, left the gathered hunters in awe, marking a significant moment of unity and strength. The narrative shifted back to the pyramid, where Songran and Yan engaged in a relentless battle against hordes of skeletal monsters. Amidst the fray, Songran recalled the cryptic words spoken by the city monster, a revelation that seemed to unlock the game's underlying mechanics. Armed with this newfound insight, he pressed on, relentlessly attacking the skeletal beasts. His deduction was that these skeletal legions were under the control of the final boss, intricately woven into the game's difficulty mechanism. Yan, too, remembered Mr. Liu's earlier mention of the hunters' impact on difficulty levels. They jointly concluded that the influx of hunters due to Songran's arrival in the pyramid directly correlated with the surge in skeleton monsters. Their shared realize, only by defeating the ultimate boss, Sadie, could they finally bring an end to this unending battle. Ironically, Songran's arrival to assist Yan only compounded their troubles. The sheer number of skeleton monsters rendered it nearly impossible for them to reach the final boss, Sadie. Undeterred by the odds, Songran relentlessly attacked the skeletal beasts. Then, he unveiled a surprise weapon, a fusion of an item acquired from the Sky Tower exit and his Blade of Evolution's sword. Yan, bewildered, listened as Songran revealed his status as an awakened hunter, part of the esteemed first echelon. Yan's frustration simmered. He had long yearned for awakening, and Songran's secrecy irked him. Their conversation was abruptly cut short as the skeletal horde closed in. The imposing sight of Songran's might sent shivers through the other skeletons, yet he pressed on, unyielding. His relentless assault continued, each strike chipping away at the remaining monsters. Despite the toll on his XP, Songran's healing skill nullified the damage, allowing him to fight unimpeded. But the cost was steep mana drained rapidly, urging him to hasten the battle's end. Confronting the Sadie monster, Songran prepared for a decisive showdown. His blade slashed, but the monster endured. The fight raged on, and Yan, lurking in the shadows, struck the monster's arm. In retaliation, the enraged monster's sight seized Yan's sword, unleashing its lethal move, the Withering Lightning. Yan's voice echoed forcefully as he sprinted, absorbing the unfolding chaos, his mind a whirl of confusion. Observing Yan, the advancing dead's forces loomed nearer. Overcome with fury, Yan vocalized his defiance, gripping the blade embedded in his chest with unwavering resolve, still grappling with the situation's full magnitude. Extracting the blade, Yan was suddenly besieged by childhood visions. He meandered through desolate structures, his foot disturbing a discarded plastic container, noticing a boy near a pole. He recalled whispers of a newcomer whose guardians were perpetually engaged in work, leaving their son unattended, marked by a static expression. Rumors abounded of his confrontations with local ruffians, voiceless against their taunt. Despite his substantial allowance, it too fell prey to their greed. Thus, he recognized himself as the most formidable adversary, known simply as Brone. Today was his designated day to confront the antagonist. Is it conceivable that he is incapable of retaliating against his tormentors? Hao managed to smile, and then Yan approached him, inquiring why such an expression. He seized his attire, bombarding him with questions in a fury. Does he perceive himself as feeble? Is he underestimating his capabilities? For an individual of his stature, who does he presume he is? With a punch, he dismissed Hao and continued, "Why does he exhibit arrogance? A wealthy offspring, indeed. And concerned about his wealth being appropriated. Does he harbor no intent of reciprocation? Is this his manner of acknowledging assistance?" His obstinacy is irrelevant. Hao gazed at him, puzzled, attempting to rise, but Yan confronted him again, clutching his neck, demanding all his wealth before departing. Hao retorted, calling them insignificant. Subsequently, he grasped his hand, uttering, "Youth." Yan regarded him with a puzzled expression, inquiring, "What is the current situation?" He bit Yan's arm, prompting an attempt to withdraw his hand, fatigued. Suddenly, blood was visible, and Hao vocally threatened disfigurement. Yan consistently remarked on Hao's audacity and peculiarity. Hao labeled him a red-haired nuisance. He retorted, "Today, retribution will be yours." Following the altercation, they paused for breath. Yan acknowledged Hao's combat skills, saying, "You indeed possess remarkable prowess." Hao suggested a desire for further challenge. Yan declined, stating he was sufficiently challenged. Subsequently, he presented a wooden sword to Hao, requesting its management. He crafted the wooden sword named Crimson, now belonging to Hao. Hao's reaction was one of astonishment, leaving him speechless. It elaborated on the notion that true recognition among individuals is forged through confrontation. Now bonded as allies, Ian pledged to instruct him in the mastery of Crimson. The initial step involves harnessing strength from the pelvic region, positioning the blade upwards, and executing a simultaneous swing, accompanied by the cry, "Sword Art, Shining Fae." Demonstrating the correct technique, Hao, with a hint of sarcasm, accepted the sword, remarking on the name Shining Fang as less than ideal. Yan responded with laughter, dismissing the critique and emphasized the importance of mutual support and adversity, akin to the sword's reliability. Suddenly, an individual approached, seizing the sword, mockingly questioning Hao's heroism with the wooden weapon and making a derisive comment about his companion. Yan reassured Hao, indicating that in times of conflict, support would be as steadfast as the sword itself. This interaction was interrupted when an outsider challenged their camaraderie, provocatively questioning Hao's valor and companionship, a moment that tested their newfound alliance. An additional antagonist approached, and in unison they forcibly dragged Yan and Hao across the ground by their attire. The individual taunted, mentioning financial difficulties and expressing a desire to borrow from Yan, perceived as Hao's companion. After encountering them, his audacity seemed to have grown. His accomplice, while seizing Hao, demanded all their money without resistance. Hao vocally implored them to take his money but spare Yan, showcasing his concern. Dismissively, the aggressor questioned their newfound boldness after throwing the money aside. In a moment of disdain, they snapped their wooden swords in two, mockingly questioning their belief in being hunters with mere toothpicks. Amidst laughter, they questioned the feasibility of Hao's intimidation tactics. Standing over the splintered remains of the swords, they boasted about their ability to overpower them effortlessly. Following this display of arrogance, they departed, leaving Yan and Hao in their wake, subject to derision. This experience catalyzed Yan's determination to become a hunter, a decision fueled by their contemptuous behavior. The incident solidified their resolve against such disparagement, marking a pivotal moment of defiance against their detractors. Yan's complexion darkened with embarrassment, as he offered an apology to Hao, visibly ashamed. He began to gather the fragments of their broken swords. Hao, placing a hand on Yan's shoulder, inquired about his well-being. Yan expressed his regret over failing to protect him. Hao reiterated his name, urging him to halt his actions, and then humorously insinuated that Yan considers himself a luminary. Despite the adversity and ridicule faced, Hao remained indifferent, considering these trials trivial. He acknowledged that Yan had imparted valuable combat skills to him. Yan, however, distanced himself, stepping away. Subsequently, in a bustling school environment, a group of students congregated by a window, engaging in conversation about a peer from an adjacent class who dared to confront a senior. They referred to the usually targeted Hong Sel, who apparently encountered an affluent and academically distinguished student that day. Meanwhile, Yan was seated at his desk, pen in hand, perusing his notebook. The conversation shifted to what Yan was holding. Speculation arose about it being a wooden sword. Indeed, Yan had salvaged the pieces of the broken sword, securing them with duct tape. This act of preservation was met with laughter from his peers, who were baffled by his attachment to what they deemed worthless. Upon hearing these remarks, Yan glanced towards the window. Adjacent to the school, Hao stood firm with a wooden sword, confronting the senior who had previously extorted money from him. Hao asserted his presence boldly, questioning if the audacity stemmed from his red-haired companion's influence, labeling them disdainfully. He vowed to demonstrate their rightful status, noting the evident tremor in his adversary's stance, indicative of reluctance to disrupt their financial exploit. The senior's legs were noticeably trembling, betraying his nervousness as he pleaded for a reduction in bravado for the day. He vowed to vindicate through Yan's sword art, charging towards the senior with the battle cry Shining Tooth. Observing from the window, some girls mockingly anticipated his imminent defeat, noting his bold engagement. Meanwhile, Yan was no longer at his desk. Outside, the sun blazed as a throng of students encircled the scene. Hao declared his newfound conviction to fight, emphasizing the value of standing for a comrade prepared to endure to the end. The adversary shattered Hao's sword and delivered a chest kick, admonishing him against ostentation. Hao grounded faced ridicule about his supposed awakening, deemed feeble. The senior scorned the wooden sword as an embarrassment, urging Hao to cease his self-disparagement publicly. Hao, with a defiant glare, implored him to halt. The sword was further demolished, with the aggressor asserting it was beyond repair, voicing his irritation. Hao retorted, affirming the true weakness lay with his opponents. Only individuals of low character boast their superiority by exploiting those weaker than themselves, deserving no more than the lowest esteem. The aggressor, poised for another strike, declared his intent to end the confrontation. At that moment, Yan intervened, commendably defending Hao with a strategic assault, rebuking the aggressor for his contempt towards Hao's awakening. Hao, witnessing Yan's valor, greeted his ally with a grin. Yan retorted to the adversary, denouncing his intellect and challenging his ability to overpower Hao single-handedly. The antagonist, nursing a bleeding lip, recognized Yan with disdain, referring to him as the troublesome redhead. His retaliatory strike sent Yan to the ground, with a taunt inviting further resistance. As he demeaned them further, a violent act against Yan underscored his contempt. Yet Jan, undeterred, mocked the bully's impending regret. In a twist, Hao sees an opportunity to counterattack, aiming a decisive blow to disrupt the bully's advantage. This act of solidarity underscored the depth of their friendship and the resilience in facing adversaries. The adversary grimaced in agony as Jan rose to his feet, advancing to deliver a retaliatory slap, expressing a dismissive farewell. The force sent the antagonist reeling, with Jan critiquing his combat skills. As blood trickled from the adversary's mouth, Hao gathered the fragmented sword, informing Jan of its damage, but assured him of its repair. Jan, acknowledging his actions, vowed never to abandon the weapon again, aspiring to become a hunter and establish his own guild. Hao, encouraged by Jan's resolve, committed to enhancing his skills as a technician, promising the restoration of any damaged weapons or armor. Their mutual pledge was sealed with a fist bump, symbolizing their agreement and camaraderie. Reflecting on these events, Jan acknowledged the insignificance of past obstacles compared to their current strength, underscoring the evolution of their resilience and determination. Even after facing obstruction 100 times, his resolve remained unshaken, adhering firmly to his core principle. As his blade showed signs of fracturing, he invoked a divine boon, the Crimson Tear Pack. Concurrently, an immense force emanated from the weapon, causing Seth to cry out. An explosion ensued, and Rank queried whether the weapon's power was being converted into an explosive force. Seth, beginning to vanish, chuckled and questioned if this exemplifies the hunter's journey. For the first time, he acknowledged being bested by a team, yet pondered the victory's significance as he would return rejuvenated. He hinted at the dawn of challenging times ahead before fading away, forewarning of impending trials. Subsequently, Seth and his legion vanished, and the system announced the defeat of Seth, the second boss of the Sea of Oblivion. Approaching Jan, Rank commended his combat proficiency. Jan, modestly deflecting the praise, credited his mana for their triumph. Jan managed to unleash his ultimate skill, albeit with a missed detail. Rank inquired about this oversight. Jan, reflecting on his error, mentioned his reckless decision inspired by Zobie's daring feat of discarding her equipment to vanquish a boss. He had gambled on collecting valuable loot from the boss without his weapon, not anticipating the specific item that would emerge. He gestured towards the magical shard, to which Ran optimistically remarked it was a fortunate gain nonetheless. Jan admitted his combat capabilities were depleted, suggesting the shard, a key artifact, could unlock the remaining dungeons. He proposed Ran undertake the challenge, safeguarding the shard as the chosen one, with a promise to reclaim it upon completion. Later, upon acquiring the shard, discovered its significance as part of an epic Seth, a rare artifact from the Sea of Oblivion embodying the deity Seth's power, with potential for fusion. Considering the possibility of integrating the shard with a sword, Ran accepted the responsibility, pondering over Seth's ominous farewell. He questioned Jan about the premonition of a looming era and trials ahead, contemplating the scripted nature of such declarations. Jan acknowledged the peculiar nature of Seth's parting words, though deemed them momentarily irrelevant, focusing on the task at hand. They resolved to navigate the dungeon in a traditional manner when unexpectedly, the system flagged anomalous alterations. An imminent update to the underground city was announced, catching them off guard as the system had not previously recorded anomalies. Speculation arose whether these irregularities were triggered by their entry into the dungeon. Shortly thereafter, the system initiated a countdown, and thunderclouds began to amass above the pyramid, prompting inquiry among the hunters. Mr. Liu admitted his unfamiliarity with such phenomena, noting the absence of similar events in the association's annals. Wang Fen suggested their preemptive dispatch was due to the anticipated complications, hinting at a transition to a seasonal format for the dungeon. Liu, cautioning against speculative discussion, reminded of the potential repercussions of such rhetoric. Prior to their departure, he was tasked with overseeing two individuals, Ran and Suki, who were marked as their primary objectives. Amidst this briefing, Wang Fen expressed his dissatisfaction with a scoff, just as the countdown neared its conclusion at 3. The colossal doors gradually swung open, revealing a creature enthroned, coinciding with the countdown's end. The system then declared the completion of the countdown and the commencement of the raid update, suggesting a brief pause. Ran found himself once again in a familiar white expanse, pondering the recurrence of this space with each transition between dungeons. He questioned his presence there, growing increasingly skeptical of the system's lifelike nature. As the system announced the raid's update, snowflakes began to descend from a sky now laden with clouds, much to the hunter's astonishment. Observations were made about the incongruity of snow in a desert setting, raising questions about the raid's update and the fate of their previously vanquished foes. The anomaly of tropical snowfall sparked further disbelief and discourse among the group. Zhaoyang, reflecting on the unusual phenomenon, remarked on the somber mood it created. Upon noticing Ran, he inquired about his whereabouts, approaching with a curiosity about the events that unfolded, acknowledging the complexity of the situation that could not be succinctly conveyed. Following their encounter with Seth, Yan and he had emerged victorious. Zhang acknowledged their success upon hearing the system's announcement. Zobiai approached, expressing relief at Ran's return, having been concerned for his well-being. Ran confessed he had not initially intended to return. Guild leader Wang inquired about the newcomer's identity, prompting Ran's introduction. The conversation shifted to a lack of consensus with the Huang Tu Guild. Ran dismissed any need for dialogue with them. Xingyu, hinting at widespread knowledge, criticized Ran for his fortunate awakening, which coincided with significant casualties within a dungeon. He provocatively suggested Ran's involvement might be linked to the unusual raid update, stirring discontent among the hunters. Lu voiced his displeasure at Wang Fen's insinuations, who then defensively argued his position on the Awakened without directly implicating Ran. Xingu confronted Ran, gripping his attire, questioning his recollection of a previous disgrace to his guild. Ran retorted, reminding him of the consequences faced by a guild member due to her malicious speech. Brushing aside the man's grasp, Ran brandished his dagger, silently questioning if a confrontation was sought, assuring a swift end without a chance for rebuttal. Lu intervened, offering assurance to the assembly that Ran's status as an Awakened One bore no correlation to the raid's modification. He mentioned sensing the initiation of a trial mode, speaking on behalf of the first echelon, advising calm until clarity was achieved. Subsequently, their quest for answers led Zhuang to inquire with the village head about the anomaly. He questioned the origins of snow in a desert landscape. The elder attributed this phenomenon to a blessing from the deity Horus, describing it as a miraculous snowfall enriching the barren desert, heralding a significant epoch. As the elder's hand trembled, he informed the adventurers their assistance was no longer necessary, implying a shift in their journey's direction. Zhang inquired about their next steps, if assistance was still required despite the NPC's peculiar state. Yan speculated on a glitch within the NPC's programming. Lu highlighted the predicament that without completing the raid, their exit was barred, marking a first in his experiences. The transformation of the village elder into a formidable entity signaled their unintended interference with a pivotal moment. As he metamorphosed, revealing scales and proclaiming their rejection of the boon meant eternal entrapment, the situation escalated. Completing his transformation into a dragon, he ascended, leaving the hunters in disarray. The unexpected shift from NPC to adversary puzzled one hunter, while Geo identified the threat as a formidable dragon-class monster, indicating a dire situation. Wang Fen, recognizing it as an earth dragon, optimistically asserted their capability to overcome this new challenge. As the dragon dominated the skies, he sought guidance from Mr. Lu, who decisively called for an all-out assault. He pointed out the necessity for precise evasion from the dragon's targeted abilities, advising lower-level hunters to dodge aerial attacks while higher-level ones should draw the dragon's focus. The dragon then amassed a surge of energy, launching it towards the hunters, prompting a counterattack. Zhang, acknowledging the chaotic turn of events, emphasized the urgent need to investigate the anomalies at the Horus Pyramid. Ran stepped forward, volunteering for the reconnaissance mission, driven by a personal sense of responsibility for the unforeseen complications. Zhang solicited additional volunteers, to which Xingyu, with a knowing smile, implicated his own relevance to the unfolding crisis. The issue seemed to stem from an impulsive act by a guild member, prompting a suggestion that he should accompany Ran for accountability. When expressed skepticism, citing the individual's unresolved injuries and questioning his reliability, Xingyu, indifferent to the concerns, insisted on proceeding. When proposed a strategy, volunteering himself and Ran to venture into the Horus Pyramid, emphasizing his qualification as a top-tier participant capable of managing any crisis within. He designated Wang Fen to lead in their absence, who humorously dismissed the necessity of his presence, reassuring Zhang with confidence that their current challenge paled in comparison to dragons, even jesting about facing 100 of them with ease. Zhang concurred with Mr. Lu's strategy, and subsequently, Ran and Yan embarked towards the pyramid. With a probing glance, Yan inquired about the veracity of the tragic outcome linked to Ran's awakening, leading to casualties during the raid. Ran affirmed, prompting Ran to elaborate on the notion that the awakening triggers a shift to a test mode in raid, inadvertently escalating the dungeon's difficulty. He reassured Ran that such unfortunate incidents, while regrettable, are not uncommon, and that Ran should not bear the weight of guilt alone. Furthermore, he suggested the complications with Suki weren't solely Ran's responsibility. Ran acknowledged the insights, mentioning Deputy Seth's briefing on Awakening, clarifying his presence was driven by responsibility rather than guilt. He noted Mr. Lu's status as a first-tier Awakened individual, querying about his own experience with Awakening. Yan, taken aback, shared his ordeal of undergoing a raid with a nascent guild, leading to significant losses among rookies despite the raid's lower level. He questioned Ran about the aftermath of his awakening, probing for any shifts in demeanor such as aggression, apathy, or malevolence, essentially wondering if Ran felt transformed. Ran contemplated sensing a change. Yang concluded such transformation is the destiny of the awakened, where initial madness and altered perception eventually give way to dominance by negative emotions, highlighting the profound impact of awakening on one's psyche and worldview. Even within the premier ranks, one wonders if any have ventured to the Sky Tower beyond its challenge mode. The inquiry about this place's nature was met with an explanation describing it as a resting place for the defeated. Suddenly, attention shifted towards an unexpected horde of adversaries. It was noted that following the game's update, the Sea of Oblivion had undergone significant changes, now presenting an unprecedented number of foes. With the Evolution Sword in hand, a pause was suggested to showcase the Premier Rank's capabilities, emphasizing the concept that the world operates like a river, where even the smallest disturbance can impact the harmony. As the monsters advanced, Yan assumed a wide stance, declaring his ability to annihilate countless ethereal entities with a singular strike. His gaze intensified, and with an outstretched hand, he unleashed a formidable energy beam that penetrated the adversaries. Ran observed with awe, recognizing the immense strength required to eliminate the horde in one fell swoop. This display of might, akin to a nightmare, demonstrated the power that could supplant multiple guilds single-handedly. Such prowess is emblematic of first-tier representatives. As Yan concluded his assault, with monsters vanquished, Ran realized his own path to power was unclear, though he was eager to ascend to such ranks. Yan, noticing Ran's momentary pause, prompted him to focus on more pressing tasks. Snapping out of his reverie, Ran affirmed his readiness. He followed, contemplating his journey to the echelons, resolved to catch up soon. Upon arriving at the entrance of the Horus Pyramid, Yan remarked that they had reached their destination. From the exterior, nothing seemed amiss. However, he cautioned against complacency. Ran concurred, curious about the current happenings within. Inside, at the pyramid's core, they encountered Suki, now under Horus's dominion. She spoke of utilizing common sense, logic, information, observation, inference, and analysis, now aided by tentacles, proclaiming her newfound understanding of the world's truths. Ran called out to her, hesitating when questioning her identity, recalling Yan's warning about her monster-induced influence. Reflecting on a previous encounter with the monster, he realized the gravity of their situation. The trio had been directly informed prior to this mission that the primary objective was ensuring the safety of Song, Ran, and Suki. However, they were also advised to prioritize the public interest should control be lost. Snapped back to reality by Ran's forward movement, Yan urgently instructed him to halt, declaring his readiness to confront the battle ahead. The entity before them, no longer Suki but a creature, had to be neutralized. Upon recognizing Ran's approach, Suki mistakenly called him Ren, laughing as she claimed anticipation of his visit. Her behavior grew erratic as she repeatedly mentioned his name, signaling her attack with a taunt about the principle of retribution within the shadowy confines of the pyramid. Ran evaded her assaults, while Yan observed the escalating peril, noting the creature's exceptional speed that rendered its movements invisible even to him. He realized the urgency to devise a delay, fearing for Ran's safety. Suki's onslaught continued, fueled by a desire for vengeance she associated with Ran's presence. Despite her relentless attacks, Ran managed to deflect her strikes. Utilizing the phantom ability, he became intangible, allowing her punches to pass harmlessly through him. After creating distance, Ran acknowledged her anger and his role in provoking it, expressing a willingness to seek forgiveness, albeit hesitantly, given her altered state. A fragment of Suki's awareness stirred, tears emerging as she uttered Ran's name. Yan, noticing her diminished pace, seized the opportunity to close in. He executed a technique likened to a mountain river's forceful split, propelling her into the wall. Device bound to her leg shattered, causing a separation of her lower half. Ran inquired about her state, to which Ran responded that her demise was not certain, suggesting the complexity of their predicament exceeded their assumptions. The system announced the conclusion of the initial confrontation with Horus, signaling the onset of an exceptional mode. Suki's form began to convulse, and a voice emanated from her, mocking human resilience as unexpectedly impressive yet futile against the inherent weakness. A mist exuded from Suki, assuming her likeness, with Horus declaring a personal management of her vendetta more fitting. Yan was deeply contemplative, puzzled by the unforeseeable escalation of chaos. Horus, with a wild grin, shared that despite never visiting the realm of the living, he found it surprisingly pleasant. He elaborated that while human convictions offer strength, exploiting these beliefs could expose their greatest vulnerability, condemning them to a descent into the abyss of their worst nightmares, to be consumed by the void. In a surreal twist of reality, Rand found himself questioning the reality of their encounter with Horus, uncertain if they were ensnared in an illusion. Concerned for Rand, he turned to find him with a vacant expression, prompting Horus to mock the situation as a mere fabrication. He claimed Rand had been ensnared in a grim and desolate domain. Yan faced Horus, dismissing his deceptions and declaring him an adversary. Horus, amused, questioned Rand's perception of his dominion over darkness and void, acknowledging no interest in him due to his apparent lack of intriguing potential. However, he noted Rand's boundless potential with interest. Upon indicating his readiness for a challenge, the ground erupted with tentacles. Yan strategically retreated as these appendages converged. Horus deployed the Art of the Sphere. Wild Forest, a power exclusive to his domain in the realm of the living, where the pyramid serves as a divine abode. This ability enables Horus to manifest colossal tentacles throughout the pyramid, asserting his dominion. Horus proposed a game outlining its simple rules. A throne crafted from tentacles was formed, upon which Horus seated himself, declaring his intention to solely target Rand without physical contact. Fascinatingly, Rand finds himself trapped within a magical dream, rendering him defenseless and immobile, incapable of evading any assaults. This predicament leaves Rand with two dire choices: succumb to the tentacles in the physical realm or perish within the enchantment of the dream. The dilemma intensifies as Rand faces the ultimate challenge: navigate through this perilous situation or confront the inevitable demise. Horus's strategy places Rand at a crossroads, with survival hanging in the balance, pushing him towards a decision with profound consequences. Confronting Rand directly, Horus revealed his cunning strategy, albeit with a self-centered perspective. He halted before Rand, offering two choices while promising protection until Rand's departure from the magical dream. Activating his powers, Horus prepared for a relentless battle, indicating Rand would have to counter his attacks continuously. The encounter evolved into a relentless struggle, with each block signaling the start of what Horus declared would be an unending confrontation. Advising against premature triumph, he acknowledged his rank as not the pinnacle within the first tier, yet highlighted his history of facing and overcoming formidable adversaries who failed to dismantle his team. As he grasped his sword, he declared that upon its unsheathing, his combat zone would transform into an invulnerable fortress. Horus inquired if there existed any possibility to dispel these seemingly unfounded aspirations. He mused on the peculiar nature of humanity, reflecting on their resilience and unpredictability in the face of adversity. Disagreeing, he reflected on a time when the loss of a loved one had just awakened him, leading to an immediate shift of the raid into test modes. Initially, he believed his newfound determination would expedite the completion of the challenge. However, advancing recklessly, he inadvertently inflicted substantial harm upon his allies, resulting in numerous casualties among the newcomers. This experience prompted a profound contemplation on the essence of such power for an awakened individual and its purpose if it merely led to such outcomes. Recalling this event frequently, especially given his role as a tank, he realized that dedicating his strength to the defense of his comrades could potentially avert such tragedies. From that point forward, his sword has been a symbol of preservation and protection, embodying his commitment to safeguarding those around him. He employed the Mountain River Technique, a high-level skill capable of leveling mountains. This method defines his expertise as a hunter, showcasing a unique high-level sphere technique. Its distinct feature lies in its ability to neutralize all adversarial forces when juxtaposed with another high-level sphere technique. The Mountain Smashing Technique, powered by the formidable ripple of a colossal sword, emits ripples every half second to deflect all incoming attacks. Moreover, this technique enhances the defense of allies within its domain by 30 of the sphere owner's total defense upon advancement. Simultaneously, it slices all tentacles into fragments. He declared that within his domain's confines, no matter the strength, his tentacles could cause no harm. This represents the ultimate suppression within the first echelon, maintaining the original meaning while simplifying language and avoiding repetition. Horus questioned the prowess of the first echelon, convinced that his sphere's power could obliterate him instantly, yet he failed to recognize that this so-called defense merely constricts his combat abilities. Disagreeing, Yan asserted that Rand was safeguarded by his domain, unfettered by any limitations. In this moment, he executed the Mountain River Wave slashing technique and surged forward. Horus prompted him to reconsider, questioning if his intention truly was to end him. Yan had initiated an attack mentally, purposely missing his target. Horus observed that his intellect remained unscathed. He warned that defeating him would plunge Rand into a state of turmoil. Even if he were to awaken from the dream realm, his soul would be engulfed in chaos and despair, preserving the essence of the original narrative while refining the language and avoiding repetition. The tentacles extended towards Yan and Horus, realizing there was no retreat and having trapped him from the opposite side. challenged him to witness the full extent of the First Echelon's capabilities. Yan continued to parry his assaults, remarking on his resilience under such onslaught. Horace, amused, informed Ran that he had been awaiting him. At that moment, Ran opened his eyes, puzzled about the recent events. Horace announced there was intriguing news. His naive friend had succumbed to the influence of his magical dream ability. He inquired for details, to which Horace explained that this magic dream transports the foe to another dimension, leaving Yan stranded in a world of nightmares. He then questioned Ran's ability to cope without his formidable ally, presenting a scenario of isolation. As the tentacles approached Ran, he swiftly severed them, prompting Horace to suggest a game, refining the narrative with a more formal tone and adherence to the guidelines. Facing Lu's inability to counter, he resolved to swiftly neutralize him before proceeding. Suddenly, a portal materialized behind Horace, unleashing a nightmarish creature that launched an assault. Ran adeptly countered the strikes, and Horace remarked on his perceptiveness. Despite his stoic appearance, Ran's inherent kindness led Horace to believe he would selflessly absorb the impending hit. Protectively covering Yan, Ran was met with Horace's taunt, urging him to embrace oblivion. Yet, employing the phantom ability, Ran rendered the tentacles harmless as they phased through him, leaving Horace bewildered. Questioning Ran's evasion, the creature halted before Yan, just as Ran initiated the blood frenzy dance, effectively severing the tentacles. Horace's hesitation, Ran insinuated Horace's intent against Mr. Lu was faltering. Despite unknown discoveries within his subconscious, Ran stood defiant in the magical dream, confronting Horace, who defensively reacted. Ran's action severed more tentacles, underscoring his frequent underestimation as mere vulnerability. However, his acknowledgement of the Master's strength and his experiences as a First Echelon member, surviving numerous encounters, showcased his resilience even against formidable techniques, maintaining narrative integrity while enhancing clarity and coherence. The confrontation reached a pivotal moment where his actions could either annihilate his opponent or eradicate the magic dream entirely. He refrained from slaying the Master, recognizing the illusion for what it was, without harboring any intent of murder. Adapting his sword's form, he positioned it at Horace's neck, inquiring about the consequences of ending his life during slumber, yet he paused, having several inquiries remaining. Foremost among them, what became of Suki? Horace, with a laugh, mirrored the inquiry, revealing that Suki, too, had succumbed to the magical dream's allure. With a hand lifted to his visage and a smirk, Horace disclosed that her subconscious had fully integrated with his, transforming her into the very essence of this dungeon's power, effectively maintaining the original content's meaning while refining the language and adhering to the specified constraints. Suki was the key to his unparalleled strength. Meanwhile, a cascade of memories surged through her, pondering her actions and the recollections of her past. Her existence felt like a remote dream, reminiscent of wandering across a snow-laden bridge under the nocturnal sky. This contemplation led her to question the very nature of reality. As her brother advanced towards the creature, unleashing his technique, a sudden realization left Suki breathless. She was within the confines of a dungeon, all unfolding within the magical dream. Just 2 hours prior, her brother had rallied their team, emphasizing the necessity of an offensive strategy to vanquish the boss and secure a bounty of rare artifacts. Launching the attack, he voiced his motivation. His sister awaited his return home, ensuring the narrative retained its original essence while refining the language to align with the specified requirements. Upon hearing the voice, Suki recognized it as her brother's. Despite the monster parrying his initial attack, her brother persisted and struck again. Suki, determined to join him, exclaimed her intention and dashed towards the door. Upon opening it, she found her brother in the hall, having just defeated the monster, proclaiming the victory as effortless. Surprised to see his sister there, he inquired about her presence. Before she could express her thoughts, he reassured her that the battle was over and the boss vanquished. Embracing her, he shifted the conversation towards dinner options, suggesting scrambled eggs with tomatoes or a meal at a cafe, followed by a treat. Overwhelmed with emotions, Suki began to cry, prompting her brother to comfort her, gently wiping away her tears and encouraging her to cease crying. He reminded her of her frequent requests to join their raids, directing her attention to the loot scattered by the defeated boss and assigning her the task of collecting it all, ensuring the narrative retained its core significance while enhancing the language to meet the specified standards. In a shocking twist, Ran emerged, drawing Suki's attention with his familiar voice. With a sinister grin, he executed her brother, declaring his claim over the artifacts. Suki stared in disbelief at Ran, his visage smeared with blood, as her brother's head came to a rest on the ground. Ran justified his actions with a cold logic, questioning why the fruits of their struggle should solely benefit his sister. His accomplice echoed this sentiment with a laugh, while another dismissed the fallen as unworthy, mockingly questioning his gold rank status. Rand proposed they capitalize on their gains, suggesting a sale to amass a significant amount of gold. Suki, consumed by rage, fixed her gaze on Rand and armed herself with a cannon, aiming it directly at him, maintaining the narrative's integrity while refining the language and adhering to the established guidelines. Rand confronted her, provoking her anger further, suggesting that her hatred towards him was warranted. With a chilling gesture, he tasted the blood on his dagger, confessing to the murder of her brother and accepting full blame. He taunted her for her dependence on her brother's prowess, mocking both her reliance and her brother's intellect. His words were designed to infuriate, labeling her brother as nothing more than a simpleton. Enraged and on the brink of retaliation, Suki found her resolve waver as her hand trembled, a sudden realization dawning upon her that the figure before her wasn't Ran. She paused, taking a moment to collect herself, and voiced her suspicion aloud, refining the dialogue to maintain the essence of the original scenario while adhering to the specified language level and removing informal expressions. Horace responded with a mocking laughter, signaling his dissatisfaction. Suki revealed that the entire scenario was a manifestation of Horace's abilities. As the illusion of Ran began to fade, she pointed out three inconsistencies within the dream. Firstly, Ran had once saved her. He was not the unhinged villain portrayed in the dream. Secondly, during an attempt on Ran's life, he chose not to evade her attack using his phantom ability, possibly out of guilt for the casualties within the dungeon. Horace dismissed this as a vulnerability. Suki then proceeded to highlight a third point. Ran, being a dual-class hunter, was endowed with a unique ability, maintaining the narrative's core while ensuring language and expressions remain refined and appropriate for the specified English level, and adhering to the guidelines regarding slang and formal dialogue. On the day he decimated their entire team, despite his inability to wield daggers, Horace criticized her for her perceived frailty. Suki, raising her voice against Horace, questioned his motives for deceiving her. Horace, cutting her off, declared that by forsaking hatred and strength, she had rendered herself weak, vulnerable, and inconsequential. Suki, maintaining her composure, retorted that if deception was his intent, a more intricate illusion would have been necessary. Horace, materializing behind her, contended that he was fully capable of crafting a complex dream, but opted for simplicity and brute shocks as they more effectively provoked the target's blind rage and anger, keeping the dialogue aligned with the specified language proficiency level while ensuring the narrative's original meaning was preserved. Suki was taken aback by Horace's sudden appearance, to which he remarked that contrary to his expectations, the dream didn't incite her anger but instead rendered her more composed. He acknowledged her intelligence, noting that while fools lose their composure and control amidst chaos, the wise seek clarity within madness. In response, Suki fired at him, commanding him to cease speaking, but Horace effortlessly dodged the attack, prompting her to seethe with hatred. Horace, with a laugh, cautioned her not to underestimate his awareness of her thoughts, maintaining the essence of the original narrative while refining the language to meet the specified English level and adhering to the guidelines regarding dialogue and terminology. Suki reflected on her journey with the Huang Tu Guild, her newfound sanctuary, which she believed had diverted her from the path of strength and revenge, rendering her complacent and weakened. Questioning her allegiance, Horace challenged her perception of the guild as her new home, tempting her with a new dream to unveil the true nature of the Huang Tu Guild. Unconvinced, Suki instructed her robot to engage the hacker mode. She reminded Horace that they were within a dungeon, a domain ruled by the system itself, implying that gaining access to the system's core would grant them dominion. She argued that the deeper they ventured into Horace's illusionary world, the closer they got to the system's heart, exposing him as an entity fearful of revealing its true identity. Successfully navigating to a loophole, Suki accessed the program, initiating the low-level mode, and declared Horace ensnared, skillfully maintaining the original narrative's essence while adhering to the specified language criteria and ensuring the dialogue and terminologies remained within the context of a fantasy game world. Horace greeted Suki's breakthrough with a smirk, acknowledging her penetration into the dream's core and the system's lower levels through a slightly ajar gateway. He posited this as the prime opportunity for her to witness his authentic essence, yet he warned that the realm of deep sleep was still under his dominion, where his powers knew no bounds. He likened her situation to self-imprisonment within a cocoon as he projected tentacles towards her in a threatening manner. Suki, unfazed, activated a command on her keyboard, nullifying the tentacles' advance. She confidently remarked that by the age of 13, she'd already mastered the skill to obliterate entire systems, having now selectively deleted certain parameters. She revealed that deep sleep represented the system's most vulnerable juncture, skillfully preserving the original narrative spirit, while adhering to the specified linguistic requirements and ensuring the dialogue remained aligned with the fantasy game world context. In this realm, they both wielded boundless power. Horace, taken aback, watched as Suki commanded Bix to initiate the fantastic form. Suddenly, firearms materialized in her grasp, and she announced that this form's codename was Spirit of the Key of Borders. Her attire transformed, and her hair shifted to a stark white. Challenging Horus, she demanded his end and unleashed a barrage of bullets towards him. As the gunfire ceased, Horus was reduced to nothing but dust, leaving behind only a fragment. Suki pondered over Horus's demise as she approached the shard, recognizing it as a Divine Horus shard. Upon touching it, the shard's energy surged into her, with Horus's presence invading her being, claiming her emotions and biases as his own, suggesting a shared destiny rooted in similar causes. Suki realized that a flood of knowledge was merging into their consciousness, encompassing monsters, humans, hunters, and the awakened. This revelation turned the challenge mode, unveiled the true essence of their world, yet despite the overwhelming insights, Suki resisted, anchored in the reality of Rand's magical dream, maintaining the narrative's core while refining the language and adhering to the specified guidelines. Horus inquired, "What's the situation? Why has he ceased communication?" Rand, maintaining his gaze on Horus, declared his awareness of Horus's contemplations. Eliminating him would be straightforward, yet the dungeon's regenerative capabilities would bring him back, permanently erasing Suki's consciousness in the process. This act would essentially be the end of a human life. The question of her humanity was left for him to determine. As tentacles started to ensnare Rand's legs, Horus noted his present vulnerability, beyond the magical illusion. His naive partner's protection was evident, yet Horus refrained from lethal action, understanding the profound yet misguided aversion to taking a life. The tentacles proceeded to encircle Rand, with Horus emphasizing that this momentary weakness would decide the destinies of his companions, Suki and Lu. Decision time was dwindling. Rand faced a pivotal choice: execute Horus to demonstrate the strength of the awakened, or succumb to oblivion, inevitably reaching the same outcome. Rand sheathed his sword, acknowledging his imperfections and vulnerabilities. Horus, with a puzzled look, listened as Rand shared his initial E-rank assessment upon becoming a hunter, highlighting his forced exclusion from everything. He had reconciled with his non-belonging in this world. The loss of his comrades within the dungeon and the inevitability of such events had led him to a realization. The fault did not lie with him but with the world itself. The natural occurrence of death only motivated him to grow stronger, serving as a tribute to his fallen allies. Yet, this pursuit of strength did not grant him peace of mind. Acknowledging his presence as the catalyst for these events, solely blaming himself, he lamented the loss of 10 friends, attributing their demise to his actions. Confronting Horus's tendency to delve into others' emotions, Rand expressed his profound guilt over his friends' deaths. However, his journey also brought enlightenment through his insights, the might of the first echelon, and the formation of new bonds, contemplating the utilization of his power. He recalled a conversation with Yan while approaching the pyramid, where Yan had prompted him to reflect on his reasons for becoming a hunter, and, out of sheer necessity, confirmed that the world's harshness compelled him to search for his life's purpose. As tentacles ensnared him, he admitted his frailty, pondering if he was prepared for such a realization. Horus immediately retorted, indicating Rand's unpreparedness. Rand came to understand that his inherent weakness was a fundamental part of his being, encoded in his DNA, a destiny he seemed bound to. Contrarily, Rand argued, highlighting Horus's lack of empathy towards the loss of close ones and the profound essence of life, stating these experiences were beyond Horus's comprehension. He emphasized that the answer to such profound questions lay with another presence in the vicinity. Utilizing his petrification skill, Rand shattered the tentacles, revealing that the true nature of Suki's humanity was for him to determine, declaring her a genuine individual. With his allies long gone, only she could respond to his profound inquiry. Horus lamented the unfortunate reality that the void had high expectations of him, nonchalantly expressing his indifference with a gesture. Subsequently, a portal materialized behind him, through which Horus unleashed Nightmare, a manifestation of animosity and resentment. Born from irrational bias and hardships, Rand contemplated his eligibility for forgiveness amidst these revelations. As Horus approached to bid farewell, the portal began malfunctioning, leading Horus to question its efficacy. Overcome by distress, he demanded silence in a raised voice, succumbing to despair as he knelt. In this moment of chaos, Suki's voice pierced through, offering solace to Rand. He reached out, seeking confirmation of her identity, urging her to awaken from the ensnaring illusion. Together, they faced the imperative to escape the confinements of their fantastical nightmare. Suki solemnly acknowledged her irreversible path, her comprehension encompassing the entirety of creation and the fundamental truths. Aware of her mortality, she initiated a profound alteration within the system's structure, expressing her all-encompassing understanding. She clarified that the fault did not lie with him. Instead, it was her responsibility to seek forgiveness. Subsequently, a system notification emerged, signaling a transformation within the dungeon's core. The regulations that governed the dungeon were undergoing revision, with the system identifying an external interference. This led to a decrease in stability, prompting a foundational reboot of the lower-level architecture. A system alert then announced the integration of new directives, indicating that the architectural reset was 35 complete, marking the beginning of a significant metamorphosis. Suki informed Ran that she was performing her final act, entrusting him with a significant request. To vanquish Horus, she promised her response would follow. With a melancholy smile, she assured Ran of her absolution, then vanished, leaving Ran in a disparate dimension, reminiscent of the initial stage of his awakening journey. Horus appeared, recognizing their location as the system's foundational levels. He speculated that Suri had expended her remaining strength to transport Ran here, mistakenly assuming the proximity to the system's core weakened an awakened being's powers. Instead, Horus boasted that it enhanced his own abilities. He taunted Ran, doubting his awakened powers in this realm. Contrary to Horus's assertion, Ran confidently retorted, revealing a change within himself. By unfastening his jacket, he declared his evolution from the person he was at the outset, signaling his readiness to confront Horus anew. Horus, visibly irritated, attempted to utilize his Wildwood skill, only to find it ineffective, leaving him bewildered at the failure of his abilities. Ran advanced towards him, expressing his disdain for Horus's reliance on deception and manipulation of emotions for power. Despite Horus's efforts to activate other skills, all were futile, prompting Ran to admit his inability to erase the memories of Horus's transgressions. Accepting his perceived weakness, Ran confidently held his sword, resolved in his purpose. Horus, in a mix of fear and disbelief, questioned Ran's newfound courage, mocking his supposed vulnerability. He pointed out Ran's weapon, belittling it as a mere damaged knife attempting to undermine Ran's resolve. However, Ran, driven by a desire to silence Horus, seized him and, with a decisive action, drove his sword into Horus's chest, ending the confrontation. As the sword's luminescence persisted, Ran realized Horus was nowhere to be seen and wondered aloud if Horus had been vanquished. His inquiry was interrupted by the vibration of his ring, signaling an urgent communication. Ran promptly sought an update from Mr. Liu regarding the external conditions. Outside the pyramid following Horus' defeat, the other hunters engaged in combat with the village chief and joined forces with the adventurers to challenge additional adversaries. Mr. Liu conveyed his uncertainty about the situation within the pyramid, but provided a detailed account of the events unfolding outside. Notably, the River City Guild faced off against Osiris, the deity of reincarnation, while the formidable Immortal Guild Clover contended with Isis, the goddess of life and magic, showcasing her formidable magical prowess. Sobe activated her dual summon ability, calling forth the queen's minions, the Black Crow and the Wolf, who immediately launched an assault. Meanwhile, an unidentified guild engaged in battle with the Earth God Ji. Concurrently, another guild, bolstered by Wang Fen from the first echelon, confronted the guardian deity of the pharaoh, Soek, before advancing towards the final destination, the Palace of Anubis. However, the dynamics within the Anubis pyramid underwent significant alterations following Yan and Ran's victory over Seth and Horus's absorption of Suki, leading to a comprehensive rewrite of the dungeon's regulations. Xingu, amidst the unfolding chaos, managed to initiate the opening of the gate. With a chuckle, he questioned the ease of the gate's opening, suggesting that the final boss might prove to be an effortless conquest, unbeknownst to Ran and his allies. The dungeon's rules had drastically evolved, a fact Xing smugly acknowledged as he proceeded to unlock the gate, with Anubis lying in wait for their arrival. Rising from his throne, Anubis denounced them as naive. Declaring himself the deity of death and embalming, he proclaimed his dominion over the Sea of Oblivion. He emphasized that during tumultuous times, the conflicts of the Chosen bear no significance. Only those granted permission could lead their team to challenge him. Holding a shard of the Chosen One, Anubis possessed the authority to grant passage for 3 minutes to his team, after which the force of death would sever all retreat paths for those not within the afterlife realm. The system inquired if they wished to utilize a privileged access to initiate the entrance. Anubis urged prompt action, advising them to value every opportunity presented. The dynamics of the Battle of the Chosen Ones have evolved, initially designed for owners of the chosen fragments to unite and unlock the gateway to the final adversary, enabling a 7-on-1 confrontation. The mechanism now permits any fragment holder brief access to the ultimate foe, even allowing those without a shard to engage in battle. Xingu urgently summoned Wang Fen, placing the burden of victory on his shoulders. Wang Fen consented, indicating his intention to consult with the council first, ensuring their actions, even if premature, would not result in reprimand. Xingu noted Wang Fen's unusual demeanor, a prompt and questioned Wang Fen if he wished to raise a contact, which he did, expressing his refusal to confront Anubis, confident in the council's decisive strategy. The activation of the dungeon in siege mode has introduced a latent threat to the city, as this mode permits the release of monsters. Sealing the dungeon necessitates acquiring the seal's heart, achievable solely in awakened mode. Typically, the council deploys select warriors from the first echelon for such missions to retrieve the seal's heart. However, with the first echelon currently restrained, the council must identify a new awakened to enable awakened mode in the Sea of Oblivion. This individual is Ran, from the awakened City of H. Consequently, the council assigned Jiaojin the task of contacting Ran and escorting him to the Sea of Oblivion. Given the premature opening of the Sea of Oblivion, it is imperative that the first echelon fulfills their mission promptly. Suki's entry into the dungeon triggered unforeseen alterations. The plan was originally set for completion upon Ran's arrival and the subsequent assistance from the first echelon. However, the premature achievement of objectives and the early unveiling of the Sea of Oblivion derailed the expected outcomes. The selection of modes is exclusively determined by the Awakened's level, offering a choice between normal and awakened modes. Additionally, the challenge level of the awakened mode scales with the selecting hunter's strength. The directive for the first echelon is straightforward, Crane, from initiating awakened mode to avoid jeopardizing ordinary hunters. The responsibility to activate awakened mode lies with Ran. Nevertheless, Suki's unforeseen interference has alarmed the council elders. The reasons behind their fear of Suki and Ran remain unclear, as their unexpected betrayal was not anticipated. Questions arise about the end of this era of duplicity, yet the answer remains elusive. In this realm, hunters follow myriad paths. His chosen path is one of relentless pursuit of power, where all actions are justified if they enhance his strength and achieve his desires. His commitment is to eliminate, obliterate, and overcome any obstacle in his pursuit. This determination defines his journey as a hunter. Faced with the mode selection on a system window, he recognizes Elder Lei as a significant challenge within the first echelon. Success implies he should have already arrived at the pyramid's entrance. He chuckled, acknowledging that he had not yet arrived and Ran had not initiated awakened mode. He suggested allowing him to activate it and transform the Sea of Oblivion into a battleground. Abruptly, he paused, pondering whether the awakened mode's boss might surpass his own strength. Confidently, he assured they were capable of conquering this boss on their own. Gut tensed, contemplating the strategy Wang Fen was employing. As the pyramid's entrance sealed, Wang Fen ventured into the desert's heart, embracing his destiny as a punisher. Inquiring Mr. Liu about the situation, he learned had vanquished Soek and proceeded to Anubis, indicating a potential complication. Should Xingyu normally defeat Anubis, the seal's heart might remain elusive. Wang Fen's intentions were unclear. He, noticing the silence, questioned if he was being heard. When the conversation turned to Ran, it was revealed he remained in a magical slumber, yet to awaken. Upon defeating Horus, Ran received a system notification applauding his triumph and bestowing upon him the hidden achievement and title of God Eater. This prestigious recognition grants him the ability to enhance his abilities by 45 during any confrontation with bosses or dungeon leaders, signifying an eternal attribute to his existence. Ran pondered the existence of such a title within this realm. Subsequently, he was rewarded with the Earring of Faith, a curious item that piqued his interest. The system informed him that this accessory boosts all healing techniques by 5 levels, a feature that astonished Ran due to the rarity and strength typically associated with such decorations. Acknowledging the item's value, he decided to equip the earring, contemplating its potential high value at auction. Upon utilizing a healing technique, Ran marveled at its enhanced potency. He realized that at the system's lowest tiers, the benefits of the evolutionary sword were nullified, indicating that the strength he was experiencing was purely his own. This realization brought him a sense of pride and beauty in his inherent power. As a class of healer, Ran felt confident in his ability to progress independently, relying solely on his skills and newfound strength. Upon a sudden revelation, the system notified Ran that he had acquired fragments, offering him a choice between a fragment of Horus or a memory shard from Suki. Curious, Ran inquired if only one could be chosen before selecting Suki's memory shard, intrigued by her promise of leaving an answer at the end. As he made his choice, memories surged into his mind, unveiling her story. Suki left behind a message, the last piece of information she wished to share, her definitive answer and the truth about their world, encapsulated in her narrative. Her journey began with enrollment in an architectural training program known as the Prometheus Plan. Suki described a normal childhood, enriched by her parents' status as hunters, which afforded them a life of prosperity and devoid of hardship. However, she acknowledged the inevitability of change, recounting the loss of her parents during a dungeon raid, an all-too-common tragedy in their realm. Following the loss of their parents, Suki and her brother were left to navigate the world on their own. She accepted the inevitability of their parents' demise as a common occurrence in their world, holding on to the belief that despite her misfortunes, the world would eventually become a better place and her aspirations would find a way to manifest. Unlike her naturally talented brother, Suki considered herself ordinary. Embarking on a path to continue her parents' legacy, she pursued a career as an architect, albeit with self-doubt about her abilities. Despite not displaying any notable talents initially and struggling with her confidence, her brother's unwavering support was a constant source of encouragement until the launch of the Prometheus Plan, aimed at assembling the finest architects. Unexpectedly, Suki was selected as one of the participants in this prestigious program known as the Thief of Flame Project, conducted at a vast research facility. Her first year was filled with rigorous education from experienced architects and detailed analyses, focusing solely on her studies. Contrary to her initial expectations, she found herself developing a keen interest in learning and enhancing her architectural skills. However, her journey took an abrupt turn when the Prometheus Plan was unexpectedly terminated after 2 years. The unexpected termination of the Prometheus Plan marked the beginning of a challenging period for her, culminating in a long-term medical treatment after being diagnosed with a rare illness. She was sent to a specialized research center for care. Upon awakening from what seemed like an endless nightmare and returning to the academy, she found that the world around her had transformed. Despite her exceptional skills as an architect, she discovered herself isolated, unable to integrate into any team, with organizations reluctant to accept her. Her anticipation of returning to normalcy was met with disappointment. The situation escalated during a swimming lesson when she found her locker vandalized, her clothes torn and soaked with an unidentified substance. Confused and hurt by the unjust treatment, she questioned why she was being targeted despite her innocence. Ultimately, she decided to take an academic leave, returning home to seek solace and understanding from her brother. Upon returning home, she immersed herself in her architectural endeavors. However, her once fervent aspiration to contribute to humanity's salvation and enact global change waned, leaving her disillusioned. Her primary concern shifted to not becoming a burden on her brother. During her revelation to Ran, she confessed that a profound resentment towards him took root in her heart following his demise, extinguishing her will to live. Clinging to this world through her hatred for him resembled a man in a turbulent river grasping at straws. She drew parallels between the awakening of hunters and her involvement in the Prometheus Plan, both serving as catalysts for transformation. The Prometheus Plan, she explained, was an audacious experiment on sanity, requiring participants to sacrifice a portion of their mental stability to amplify other attributes. For her, it enhanced her intellect and insight, while for hunters, it bolstered physical strength and resilience. Central to this experiment was the monster factor, which once integrated into her, markedly distinguished her from her peers, rendering her an outlier unable to assimilate into any group. The overarching aim of the Prometheus Plan was to engineer awakened beings from the general populace, who could later be utilized for unspecified purposes. As Suki's message began to warp, Ran questioned if there was interference with the memory transmission. Suddenly, her image vanished, and the system alerted him that test mode was initiated. Instantaneously, the boss materialized before him. Meanwhile, a girl rushed to inform the guild leader of their comrade's perilous situation, just as other hunters faced defeat. She halted before the boss, conveying the urgent status of their allies, but in a swift moment, an unseen assailant dismantled the boss and targeted the girl. He, attempting to catch a glimpse of the swift figure, inquired about the identity of this. Ran encountered a formidable adversary in the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon, facing off against the elusive, hidden boss. Meanwhile, at the River City Guild, a sense of shock pervaded as hunters began succumbing to an unseen force falling one by one. The few who survived brought grim tidings to the guild chief, who was stunned to learn that their ranks were diminishing not at the hands of the local monsters, but due to a mysterious assailant. This unknown entity had not only dispatched the boss monster, cleaving off one of its limbs, but also demonstrated overwhelming strength against the hunters sent to relay the critical situation. The assailants' bold aggression did not stop there. They proceeded to target the guild chairman directly, escalating the threat level significantly. The guild chairman swiftly maneuvered to evade and counter the unexpected assault. As the dust settled, the attacker's identity came to light. It was Wan Fong, who had been mercilessly targeting the remaining hunters. Tragically, no hunter survived the onslaught. Witnessing the demise of his comrades, the heartbroken chairman implored Wan Fong to cease the carnage. Contrary to everyone's expectations, Wan Fong declared his belief that embracing the hunter's path was inherently malevolent, confessing that the act of killing and descending into demonhood was his source of joy. Without hesitation, Wan Fong then directed his aggressive intent towards the guild leader, initiating another attack. At this critical juncture, the system intervened, announcing the activation of Awakening Mode, a development that left Wan Fong perplexed as he had not activated it himself. It was speculated that Mr. Liu, having learned of Wan Fong's betrayal, had initiated the Awakening Mode, Mr. Liu's objective was to secure the essence of the dungeon seal, a crucial step in addressing the crisis unfolding within the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon. Contrary to Wan Fong's assumption, his attempt to trigger his own awakening was met with silence from the system, indicating that Mr. Liu was not behind the awakening's activation. The inability to suppress the end mode suggested an external force at play. It became apparent to Wan Fong that the source of the uncontainable awakening mode was Ran, who wielded a formidable power beyond Wan Fong's capability to override. Motivated by a desire to usurp this power, Wan Fong resolved to confront Ran, aiming to eliminate him and seize his skill item. Meanwhile, the River City Guild Master, overwhelmed by the psychological torment of witnessing his fellow hunter's merciless annihilation by Wan Fong, was in a state of profound distress, manifested through tears of blood. Mr. Liu positions himself at the Anubis Pyramid's entrance, anticipating Wan Fong's arrival with the intent to thwart Ran's entry. True to predictions, Wan Fong makes his appearance, setting the stage for a confrontation with Mr. Liu. This clash, featuring two top-tier hunters of the first echelon with awakened abilities, promises to be a fierce battle of strength and wit. Meanwhile, within the depths of Ran's subconscious, he faces the hidden boss Monster. Contrary to Ran's expectations, Era, the entity behind Diet Yer, reveals a non-hostile stance and offers Ran a fragment item. This unexpected turn of events hints at deeper layers and alliances within the mystical world they navigate. At the Anubis Pyramid's forefront, Wan Fong and Mr. Liu commence their duel, showcasing their formidable prowess. Their intense combat, marked by a rapid exchange of powerful strikes, underscores their status as top-tier first echelon hunters. The force of their confrontation is so intense that it vibrates through the air around them. Despite the fierce competition, Mr. Liu, leveraging his superior strength, momentarily gains the upper hand, sending Wan Fong crashing to the ground. In his strategic move, Wan Fong taunts Mr. Liu with accusations of betrayal, igniting his anger. Amidst the escalating conflict, Wan Fong unleashes a concealed ability, catching Mr. Liu off guard with a significant injury, demonstrating a surprising increase in his power. At this critical juncture, Ran intervenes, urgently requesting them to halt their battle, introducing a potential moment of truce in the midst of chaos. Upon Ran's arrival, Wan Fong immediately shifted his focus, his intent to eliminate Ran evident in his advance. In response, Mr. Liu unleashed his most powerful technique, generating tremors that mirrored an earthquake, successfully capturing Wan Fong's attention away from Ran. Seizing this moment, Mr. Liu revealed to Ran the betrayal by Wan Fong, committing himself to confront the traitor. With Mr. Liu's assurance to contain Wan Fong, Ran hastened towards the Anubis Pyramid, identified by Mr. Liu as the key to overcoming the formidable Anubis. During the intense confrontation, Wan Fong executed a swift and surprising move against Mr. Liu, ending the battle decisively. Wan Fong's prowess was undeniable. Concurrently, Ran proceeded deeper into the Anubis Pyramid, navigating its challenges in pursuit of their ultimate goal. So within the depths of the pyramid, the Huangchu Guild found themselves overwhelmed as the conflict escalated beyond their control. On the cusp of triumph, the guild faced a devastating reversal when Anubis unleashed a formidable surge of power, overshadowing the guild's advancements with the unpredictable forces of the Awakening Dungeon. The deputy captain of the Huangchu Guild urged the guild master to consider a strategic withdrawal, suggesting the hunters needed to regroup and recover. However, the guild master stood firm, determined to press on. Their resolve was clear: the Huangchu Guild would not retreat in the face of adversity. Those hunters who ventured closest to the formidable Anubis received a deadly mark, signifying them as the deity's chosen adversaries. Bearing this mark was a grim indicator of being singled out by Anubis for his wrath. Undeterred, the hunters pressed forward with the hope of vanquishing Anubis. Yet as they drew nearer, Anubis's might intensified. Undergoing a dramatic transformation, Anubis ascended to its second form, unfurling a majestic pair of wings. With a mere flick, Anubis soared into the heavens. From this aerial vantage, Anubis unleashed its potent magic, showering the hunters with a barrage of destructive spells. The deity employed a formidable arsenal of death magic, a discipline that wielded the grim power to devastate those caught within its reach. The hunters, marked by their valor but ensnared in the path of Anubis's wrath, faced the full fury of this ennient magic. Aware of the imminent peril, the hunters opted for an immediate withdrawal. In this critical moment, Ran emerged, prompting the Huangchu Guild's leader to instruct his team to evacuate and avoid Anubis's lethal onslaught. The retreat sparked a vengeful plot within the Huangchu Guild, harboring a deep-seated animosity towards Ran. Seizing this moment, their leader commanded a mage to execute a covert strike against Ran, channeling years of accumulated resentment. However, the assault inadvertently targeted Anubis instead, inadvertently designating Ran as its primary adversary. In response, Anubis directed its deadly assault at Ran, who skillfully evaded the attack. With resolve and a strategic advantage, Ran activated the God Eater artifact, significantly amplifying his strength. This newfound power propelled him towards Anubis, allowing him to deliver a precise and forceful blow that left the formidable monster staggering in agony. In retaliation, Anubis unleashed a formidable assault, but Ran skillfully evaded using his phantom skill, leading the monster's strike to devastate a pillar of the pyramid instead. The forceful impact caused significant structural damage, resulting in the pyramid's roof caving in amidst a cascade of debris. Amidst this turmoil, Ran's agility was unmatched. He adeptly maneuvered through the chaos, evading the perilous downfall of the structure. With graceful and calculated movements, he wove through the accumulating rubble and mounted an aggressive counterattack against Anubis, targeting the monster's vulnerability with precision. Ran's strike was impactful, compelling Anubis to revert to its original form, significantly reducing the threat it posed. Anubis found itself grounded, its wings damaged beyond the capacity for flight. The Huangtu Guild observed Ran's remarkable display of prowess and astonishment, having not foreseen his emergence as a powerful hunter, especially with the threat of the Death Mark looming over him. Undeterred by the challenges he faced, Ran prepared for Anubis' resurgence from the debris, poised to reclaim its strength. In the face of adversity, Ran tapped into his healing skill, fueled by a surge of determination to overcome the forces pressing against him. As Anubis advanced, Ran stood ready, wielding his evolutionary sword. He skillfully parried Anubis' onslaught, initiating a fierce duel. Their confrontation was intense, marked by a series of powerful exchanges that inflicted further damage on the already crumbling pyramid. Members of the Huangtu Guild observed in disbelief as the once grand edifice continued to disintegrate under the force of the battle between Ran and Anubis. Jiwei had announced a pivotal moment. Anubis had recuperated, manifesting his wings anew, ready to dominate the skies once more. As Anubis prepared for another assault, Ran voiced his unwavering resolve to defeat the deity and revert him to his original state. The narrative then transitions to the exterior of the pyramid, where a gravely wounded Mr. Lu, having suffered from Wang Fen's aggression, is found. Wang Fen, amused by Mr. Lu's plight, couldn't help but sneer. Yet Mr. Lu, undeterred and with steadfast belief in Ran's capabilities, asserted his confidence that Ran would triumph in the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon, effectively silencing Wen Fang's mockery. Mr. Lu activated his forbidden mode, harnessing the latent monster gene that grants hunters extraordinary abilities at the risk of their own consciousness. This drastic measure was taken to prevent Wang Fen from disrupting Ran's critical confrontation with Anubis. Despite sustaining injuries, Mr. Lu marshaled his remaining strength to detain Wang Fen, ensuring Ran could focus on his duel. As Wang Fen advanced, Mr. Lu readied his defense, unleashing a potent area skill that unleashed seismic forces, fracturing the earth beneath them. The intensity of the skill not only repelled Wen Fang but also inflicted damage, propelling him backward with considerable force. Despite facing resistance, Wang Fen relentlessly taunted Mr. Lu, challenging him to engage in a genuine battle. Utilizing his Shadow Assassin's skill, Wang Fen became invisible, mirroring the elusive nature of Ran's phantom skill, thereby complicating Mr. Lu's ability to pinpoint his location. Nonetheless, Mr. Lu maintained his composure, undeterred by Wang Fen's disparaging remarks about his expulsion from the Hunter Association and labeling as an outcast. The confrontation between Mr. Lu and Wang Fen escalated, with Mr. Lu asserting that the conflict could only end with one of their demises. Wang Fen, exhibiting remarkable speed, readied his assassin sword for a decisive strike against Mr. Lu. Concurrently within the pyramid's confines, Ran waged an intense battle against Anubis, unwavering in his determination to overcome the formidable foe. Observing from a distance, members of the Huangtu Guild were captivated by Ran's display of might and resilience, showcasing his exceptional abilities and strength. Despite the duration of the conflict, Ran sustained an extraordinary level of energy, skillfully engaging with Anubis, who was at peak strength. Matching the deity's formidable onslaught, Ran demonstrated exceptional combat prowess, eventually penetrating Anubis' defenses and triggering execution mode. This critical moment offered Ran the chance to swiftly conclude the dungeon's challenge by personally defeating Anubis. The leader of the Huangtu Guild, astounded by Ran's rapid advancement, momentarily considered the possibility of Ran single-handedly defeating the final boss. Yet, driven by greed, he plotted to slay Anubis himself to claim the deity's treasures. Advancing towards Anubis with his formidable arsenal, he initiated an assault, expecting to exploit Anubis' weakened state. Contrary to his expectations, his strikes made no impact on Anubis' defenses, even though the monster was ostensibly vulnerable. In a swift counterattack, Anubis retaliated, launching the guild leader against the pyramid's wall with tremendous force, causing it to collapse. The head of the Huangtu Guild was left in shock, pinned against the remains of the crumbled structure. Anubis, engulfed in fury, swiftly summoned a radiant spear of light, hurling it at the guild leader with alarming velocity. This act of aggression sent waves of panic through his followers. Ran, having observed the scene unfold, was left utterly bewildered, puzzled by Anubis's capability to fight back despite supposedly being in a state of vulnerability. He watched as the formidable deity turned away, retreating to its throne, leaving Ran grappling with shock and confusion. Upon his throne, the formidable deity Anubis initiated a transformative sequence. A vibrant yellow aura enveloped the vicinity as lightning surged within the pyramid of Anubis, heralding the awakening of Anubis's most formidable incarnation. This significant shift resonated through the pyramid's corridors, signaling Anubis's transition into his ultimate and most powerful form. In anticipation, the hunters within the pyramid fortified their positions, deploying their defensive shields in preparation for the impending onslaught. Understanding the gravity of the situation, all mages present were summoned to erect their protective barriers, bracing themselves for the formidable god Anubis's forthcoming display of his ultimate abilities. The culmination of Anubis's power was unleashed, its force so powerful that it not only shattered the pyramid of Anubis, but also illuminated the surrounding pyramids with its brilliance. Ran, unyielding, confronted the monster's formidable onslaught. The impact of Anubis's ultimate power was felt even outside the pyramid, affecting both Wanfang and Mr. Liu. Ran, though resilient, was forced to retreat under the overwhelming might of Anubis, now transformed into its final, most fearsome form. Faced with this unprecedented power, the hunters of the Huangtu Guild had no recourse but to evacuate, recognizing the impossibility of withstanding the god's force. The scene of hunters fleeing from Anubis, desperate to save themselves, underscored the direness of their predicament. Ran retrieved a mystical item bestowed upon him by the god during his venture within the sacred Jinjutsu of Horus. This artifact promised to amplify his strength significantly. Clutching the item, Ran recalled the gutter's mandate to conclude the battle and eternally seal the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon. Although utilizing this item would enhance Ran's capabilities, it came with a considerable drawback. Activation would consume all of Ran's energy, rendering him exhausted and vulnerable. Nonetheless, Ran accepted this consequence as a necessary sacrifice for the welfare of humanity, demonstrating his unwavering commitment to the greater good. Upon activating the item, Ran was enveloped in a magnificent aura, elevating him to the legendary Gadari mode. This newfound power surged through him, enhancing his strength exponentially. Meanwhile, the Huangtu Guild's hunters were engulfed in chaos, frantically seeking refuge from the formidable Anubis. In a dramatic turn, Ran, now empowered and swift, navigated through the tumult, aiding the beleaguered hunters with unmatched speed and precision. He engaged directly with the threat posed by the god, showcasing his elevated prowess and determination to protect. Despite the swift onslaught from Anubis, Ran's agility surpassed the deity's, enabling him to shield the hunters from harm. Astonishment struck Anubis upon witnessing Ran, now imbued with the formidable essence of the legendary deity Ray from the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon. The notion that a mere mortal could wield divine power bewildered Anubis, challenging his belief in the exclusivity of godly strength within the dungeon's confines. Fueled by wrath, Anubis directed a fierce assault towards Ran, who skillfully evaded every attempt with unparalleled swiftness. The Huangtu Guild's hunters observed in amazement as Ran showcased his extraordinary abilities. Yet, amidst their admiration, concerns arose regarding the sustainability of Ran's divine transformation. With the balance of the conflict hanging by a thread, Ran's potential reversion to mortal form before the defeat of Anubis loomed ominously, threatening dire consequences for all within the pyramid. In response to his growing fury, Anubis deployed a volley of laser beams, each meticulously dodged by Ran, demonstrating his exceptional agility and control. Elevating into the air with unparalleled speed, Ran executed his strategy with precision. Suspended in flight, his exceptional agility enabled him to dodge the onslaught of Anubis and position himself advantageously. In a moment that seemed to pause time itself, Ran unleashed the Dance of the Blue Dragon. This technique created multiple images of Ran, each delivering a powerful strike against Anubis. Harnessing his accumulated power, Ran focused it into a singular, devastating attack. The force of this strike overwhelmed Anubis, reducing the formidable deity to dust. The Huangtu Guild's hunters watched in stunned silence, overwhelmed by Ran's display of power. This extraordinary feat left onlookers in a state of awe, marveling at the strength and determination of Ran. A system alert emerged, extending congratulations to all hunters for their triumph over the formidable deity Anubis and marking the closure of the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon. In the aftermath of the dungeon's conclusion, Mr. Liu inquired about the guild responsible for defeating Anubis. Clarifying a previous misunderstanding, Mr. Liu noted that the Huangtu Guild had initially communicated their withdrawal from the Anubis confrontation. Yet, it was Ran who ultimately stood as the victor, single-handedly ensuring the defeat of Anubis. A system alert materialized before Ran, confirming his solo victory over Anubis, which entitled him to all the rewards. As Ran endeavored to claim and allocate his rewards, his energy began to wane due to mana exhaustion. Nevertheless, he succeeded in activating the yes option on the display, securing an enhancement for his sword. Meanwhile, the other hunters within the dungeon initiated their reversion to human form as a countdown from 5 to 1 commenced, signaling the permanent closure of the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon. Those who had endured the dungeon's challenges were seamlessly transported back to the human realm. Amidst diminishing consciousness, Ran entrusted Selby with the task of delivering the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon's core to a designated recipient. Yet he succumbed to unconsciousness before he could specify the individual. The system broadcasted the triumphant conclusion of the dungeon, attributing the victory to Ran's heroic deeds. Even in unconsciousness, Ran's courage was immortalized. As the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon saga concluded, Wang Fen, now exposed as a betrayer, swiftly fled the Hunter Assembly. His deceitful actions warranted a global criminal status by the Hunter Association. In a strategic move to retrieve the sealing core from the dungeon, the Hunter Association mobilized its elite members for a raid. However, their efforts were thwarted by a traitor within their ranks, leading to an unforeseen calamity. This betrayal unleashed a wave of formidable monsters from the dungeon, which descended upon Ran's city, wreaking havoc and leaving it in desolation. In the aftermath of the city's ruin, a determined man ventured alone into dungeon siege, facing its dangers head-on. With unmatched bravery and skill, he conquered every monster that stood in his way, ultimately bringing the dungeon siege to a close. This formidable individual became known as Mr. Traitor, a name that belied his heroic actions within the dungeon's depths. 3 months following the closure of the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon, a new city rose, offering its inhabitants a beacon of hope and renewal. Within this burgeoning metropolis, Ran found himself in a hospital. Emerging from a prolonged state of unconsciousness, wakening from a 3-month coma, his eyes slowly adjusted to the light, and he was greeted by the familiar faces of Selby and Yan, who had been steadfastly by his side. Bewildered, Ran inquired about his current location, learning from his friends that he had been hospitalized, enveloped in darkness for months. They recounted the events that had unfolded in his absence, detailing the devastation that had befallen his former city. Despite the shock and disbelief that washed over him, Ran drew comfort from the presence and support of Selby and Yan, his anchors in a sea of tumultuous change. The situation grew more complex for Ran, who had been homeless even before the disaster struck. With no place to call home, he grappled with finding a solution. Unexpectedly, Mr. Liu, a representative from the Hunter Association, paid him a visit. Mr. Liu revealed that during Ran's coma, Director Jin Yan had insisted on meeting him once he regained consciousness. As the harsh reality settled in, Ran slowly accepted his new circumstances. Mr. Liu informed him that he would visit after Ran's hospital discharge. He cautioned Selby and Yan not to disturb their friend, who had just awakened from a coma. Disappointment clouded their faces. They had hoped to celebrate Ran's recovery by sharing a meal together. However, their plans were dashed when Ran was whisked away directly to meet Director Jin Yan. Crestfallen, the friends exchanged glances, realizing their anticipated reunion would have to wait. Yan's whispered words, Room 317, caught Ran off guard. He sensed that there might be a hidden meaning or clue behind this cryptic message. In due time, Ran arrived at the Hunter Association as promised. There, he was met with cautious hospitality from its members. The mention of Room 317 lingered in his mind, leaving him curious and apprehensive. What secrets awaited him within those numbered walls? Only time would reveal the truth, and Ran braced himself for whatever lay ahead. The stage was set, and a smiling Ran finally stood face to face with Jin Yan. Jin Yan revealed that Ran's remarkable strength demonstrated in the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon had caught the association's attention. They were keen on recruiting him as either a police officer or a hunter security guard, responsible for tracking down rogue hunters. Given his performance in the dungeon, Ran was entitled to more information, perhaps even the truth behind his mother's untimely demise. Initially, Ran felt a glimmer of hope when the association offered information about his mother's death. However, as time passed, doubt crept in. Why hadn't they shared the truth from the outset if they truly believed it to be credible? Throughout his trials in the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon, Ran couldn't shake the feeling that the Hunter Association was merely using him to acquire the sealing core, a means to an end in their quest for details about his mother's demise. Ran believed the truth to be a closely guarded secret, accessible only to those with high authority. However, as he delved deeper into the mysteries surrounding the gene factor of monsters, Suki's inhumane experiments, and the enigmatic Sky Tower, Ran's perspective shifted. The truth was no longer a mere secret about his mother's death. It was a sprawling revelation, a hidden tapestry that wove together the very purpose of the Global Elite Hunter Association. His skepticism toward the Hunter Association grew. He doubted they would willingly disclose the details of his mother's demise. In the end, Rand made a choice: to remain an ordinary hunter, rejecting their offer. But fate had other plans. A man flanked by an imposing entourage strode into the room, an influential figure within the association. Rand knew he had to tread carefully, for this encounter held the key to unraveling the truth. However, Jinian requested a moment to finish speaking with Rand. Despite her pleas, she was forcibly taken away by the man's subordinates. The stranger then revealed himself as Tianji, the leader of the Hunter Police in Ass City, a newly established town under Rand's control. Tianji was also a renowned hunter who had been appointed as the head of the Security Association. Tianji went straight to the business at hand and asked about Suki's conversation with Rand during their time in the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon. This was when Rand began to piece together the truth. The Hunter Association had recruited Rand to monitor him closely due to his knowledge of their perilous experiments. This sensitive information, if leaked, could jeopardize the Association's operations. Rand clarified that Suki hadn't divulged any significant details during their encounter. Her sole intent had been to express a desire for revenge and his demise. Furthermore, Rand debunked the myth surrounding Room 317, previously mentioned by Yan, revealing it as a fabrication orchestrated by Mr. Liu. In a tense exchange, Tianji and Rand discussed the abilities he wielded during his battle with the Anubis monster. Rand asserted that this power emerged amidst system chaos and was linked to a fragment obtained from the deity Gadadar. Tianji scoffed, dismissing it as nonsense. He claimed multiple methods to verify the truth, prompting Rand to question why Tianji sought answers he seemingly already possessed. Tianji chuckled, revealing that he had taken necessary precautions. Their conversation was being monitored by the deputy chairman of the Global Hunter Elite, an unseen observer from a remote location, as Rand kept an eye on Yan. A man approached, urgently requesting Jinian to transfer Rand to the next checkpoint. The Hunter Association swiftly took custody of Rand, placing him under their watchful gaze. Jinian implored Rand to trust her, assuring him of her loyalty. Yet Rand remained stoic, withholding any response. Abruptly, their car became a battleground. Ambushed, they radioed for assistance from Association headquarters, their lives hanging in the balance. Through the rearview mirror, a pursuing car loomed, its intent unclear. The source of danger remained elusive, and Ron's fate teetered on the edge. The high-speed chase unfolded on a city bridge, the mysterious figure observing from above. With lightning precision, he struck the pursuing car, flipping it violently. Next in his sights, Rand's vehicle. A single blow rendered both passengers unconscious. The attacker's identity remained shrouded in mystery as he approached the wreckage. But fate had other plans. From thin air, Rand materialized behind the stranger wielding his forbidden phantom skill. The Hunter Association's rules be damned. When a hunter's life hung in the balance, Rand activated his ghostly power. He challenged the man's motives, only to be met with a cryptic response, the stranger claiming to have saved Rand's life. The truth lay hidden, veiled in enigma, and Rand stood at the precipice of revelation. The enigmatic man, a representative of the Mercury Cup, unveiled their mission: to free Rand from the Hunter Association's clutches. An invitation hung in the air would Rand join their ranks. This stranger, far from ordinary, exuded an aura of formidable strength. Meanwhile, Jinian emerged from the wreckage, battered and desperate to convey something crucial. Yet Rand remained unmoved, his resolve unshaken. The path ahead blurred with uncertainty, and the truth lay hidden, waiting to be unraveled. In that pivotal moment, Jinian unveiled the grim truth surrounding Rand's mother's demise. Regrettably, Jinian lay in critical condition following the brutal car attack. The revelation was chilling. Rand's own father had been the architect of his mother's death. Jinian's knowledge was no accident. She had once served as a subordinate under Rand's father. But fate took a dark turn when his father succumbed to the monstrous gene factor, unleashing a violent rampage that ultimately led to his confinement in the Forbidding Sky Tower. Upon hearing this revelation, Rand's heart swelled with a potent mix of anger and loathing, directed squarely at his own flesh and blood. The narrative transitions to a convenience store, where, a mere 3 days post-visit, alarming revelations emerge concerning a violent episode against the Hunter Association. Unexpectedly, Rand emerged as the chief suspect in this grim affair, implicated in the demise of three Association members, Jinian included. He stood accused of orchestrating a catastrophic event on a flyover, resulting in three fatalities. Despite Rand's prior commendation as a valorous individual who deftly sealed the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon, the Hunter Association's investigative unit deduced his involvement in the murder and assault. Contrary to a celebrated act of valor, conjectures arose suggesting the assault might be linked to Wang Fen's deceit within the dungeon's confines. The Hunter Association seized this juncture to disseminate misleading narratives about Rand, thereby curtailing his freedom. Having come into possession of confidential data from the association, Ran was astounded to find himself evading the very entity to which he had pledged his allegiance as a hunter. He was now branded as a high-level felon, charged with orchestrating a deadly mishap on a flyover bridge and the demise of three association members. Previously celebrated for his valor in sealing the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon, Ran found his reputation tarnished by the media and the Hunter Association, who propagated unfounded claims of his involvement in a betrayal within the dungeon. Over the span of 3 days, Ran was perpetually on the move in dire search of basic sustenance and shelter. He likened himself to a preyed-upon beast, a stark contrast to the accolades he had received for accomplishing a significant quest. Ultimately, he sought refuge in a remote inn, a temporary sanctuary to consolidate his thoughts and plan his next move. The Mercury Cup faction, harboring their own grievances against the Hunter Association, permitted Ran liberty, recognizing him as a formidable challenger to the organization's clandestine operations. Ran reminisced about his encounter before embarking into the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon, recalling the lesson on crafting a mini portal. This skill empowered him to independently navigate dungeons, a liberty he employed to infiltrate the Sky Tower, thereby initiating a direct confrontation with the Hunter Association. Within the Sky Tower, Ran valiantly combated the resident monsters, demonstrating his resolve to oppose the association. His augmented strength and refined skills allowed him to effortlessly dispatch the insectoid adversaries within the tower. The ease with which he eliminated these creatures was akin to slicing through vegetables. Ascending to the 30th floor of the Sky Tower, his momentum remained unbroken, wielding the mighty level 6 evolutionary sword and adorned with the esteemed title of God Eater. Ran ventured into the Sky Tower, driven by a profound sense of mission. Driven by a quest for clarity about his father's enigmatic past, Ran was resolute in his mission to unearth the truth. Progressing deeper into the tower, he came face to face with the level 30 final adversary, known ominously as the Swinging Soul Swordsman. This confrontation was unparalleled in Ran's journey thus far. The formidable foe issued a challenge, daring Ran to demonstrate his mettle. Unwavering, Ran stood ready for the climactic duel, his reliable sword at the ready, poised to confront his most formidable challenge and affirm his status as the true God Eater. With a menacing roar, the beast brandished its sword, poised for the onset of battle. Exhibiting masterful swordsmanship, it showcased a breathtaking exhibition of might and skill. Ran, undaunted yet impressed by his foe's prowess, showcased his exceptional agility by evading the monster's onslaught with ease and swiftly launching a counterattack. In a spectacular display of speed, he disappeared from the creature's view, only to reemerge atop it, catching the behemoth unawares. The monster experienced an odd sense of recognition, perceiving Ran not merely as an adversary but as a sovereign of swordsmanship. A look of deep connection filled its eyes, hinting at a profound bond with Ran as memories of its human existence, once soaring the skies, resurfaced. With a decisive strike, Ran bid the vanquished boss farewell, wielding his sword with the might befitting a true champion, thereby unveiling the saga of their intertwined fates. The creature endured the full brunt of Ran's blade, recognizing it as a beacon of hope for all beings of its kind. In its dying moments, it hailed Ran as the ultimate swordsman envisioned to dispel the shadows and restore tranquility to a strife-ridden realm. As it lay defeated, the monster softly inquired about his identity. Upon hearing his name, its eyes gleamed with recognition, and it beseeched Ran to ascend to greater heights of strength. In its gaze, Ran was not just a conqueror but also a cherished ally, embodying a beacon of hope. In a pivotal moment, as the monster was on the verge of disclosing critical information to Ran, a female guardian of the Sky Tower intervened, halting their exchange. She alerted Ran that the Hunter Association was aware of his presence within the tower, and advised him to cease his intrusion to avoid apprehension. With a gesture, she conjured a portal for Ran's departure, understanding his reluctance to compound his troubles. Ran promptly utilized the portal, vanishing from the Sky Tower's confines. Following his departure, the guardian addressed the vanquished final boss, inquiring about a key the monster had alluded to. She then signified that the boss, now sentient and recalling its past, would be reset to prevent the leak of sensitive information, acknowledging its reawakened consciousness as a threat. With a simple motion, she terminated the monster's existence, leaving a stark reminder of the formidable power she wielded, a power overwhelming even for monsters. Upon exiting the portal, Ran encountered the Hunter police, prepared to apprehend him, yet he skillfully eluded their capture, delivering a swift kick to one officer. The tension escalated when an unexpected fireball assault was launched, causing an explosion. Ran adeptly avoided the blast, which ignited a fierce blaze. Accused of a grave crime by the Hunter police, Ran found himself compelled to fend off their accusations. Despite his efforts to avoid conflict, The hunters interpreted his restraint as conceit and intensified their assault. Bran, facing their onslaught, managed to dodge an attack from the ambush team's leader, who was visibly astonished by Rand's formidable prowess at such a young age. Understanding the urgency of the situation, they recognized that Rand could become a significant adversary if not dealt with promptly. The hunters resolved to eliminate Rand, who stood in defiance, refusing to collaborate. With remarkable agility, the man activated his special skill, Demon Sealing, Thousand Arrows, launching an onslaught of arrow-like beams at Rand. Despite the ferocious assault, Rand skillfully evaded each attack, quickly neutralizing two assailants from the ambush squad and directly challenging their captain. The leader was taken aback by Rand's prowess, unable to respond before being swiftly defeated by a single decisive strike. The team dispatched by the Association was effortlessly overpowered by Rand, showcasing his exceptional strength in a stunning display of dominance. Tempestuous weather mirrored the tumultuous circumstances surrounding Rand, caught in a literal storm. Concurrently, Jinian and his guild were convened at his abode, fraught with concern for Rand, from whom they had received no news since his detention by the Hunter Association. The recent spread of allegations against Rand, accusing him of instigating an accident, left them in confusion, struggling to discern the truth. A sudden knock at the window interrupted their contemplation. To their astonishment, upon opening it, they discovered Rand on their threshold. They greeted him warmly, offering him refreshment, which he accepted with appreciation. The flavor of the drink surprised Rand, unfamiliar yet delightful, prompting him to express his sincere thanks for their hospitality. As they relaxed, the group was keen to hear about Rand's adventures since he had left. The conversation flowed from his successful wholesale business to the more clandestine topics like the Monster Gene Factor and the Prometheus Project. The revelations shared were both intriguing and startling. Curious about Rand's future intentions, Jinian inquired about his plans. However, Rand faced uncertainty, with the Hunter Association closely pursuing him, making dungeon access impossible. He acknowledged that evading capture was not a viable long-term strategy. While they were deliberating over their predicament, a notification abruptly appeared on their status window, presenting a message that directed Rand to a specific location the following day. Upon his arrival, Rand was met by a familiar face, Jinian, a fellow hunter. The encounter was unexpected, leaving Rand puzzled about Jinian's motives for being there. To Rand's astonishment, Jinian revealed his intention to eliminate him, a revelation that deeply shocked Rand, given their previous alliance within the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon. Jinian had been a comrade in arms and the leader of the River City Guild, which had suffered a tragic fate at the hands of Wang Fen in the very same dungeon. Confronted by Jinian's sudden aggression, Rand sought to defuse the situation through dialogue, hoping to uncover the root of their discord. Nevertheless, Jinian was unyielding, asserting that his newly awakened powers granted him the liberty to choose between benevolence and malevolence. With these words, Jinian drew his sword and inflicted a wound on Rand, escalating the confrontation. Discovering Jinian's formidable power came as no surprise, given his diamond-level hunter status. Rand, quickly deploying his healing skill to mend his wound, armed himself with his sword, bracing for a decisive confrontation. Without delay, he initiated an assault on the hunter. Their battle was fierce, with exchanges of powerful strikes, and Jinian even appeared to take pleasure in the combat. Jinian's attempt to overpower Rand with his wind sword recast technique was thwarted when Rand countered with a nimble kick, sending Jinian tumbling backward. As Jinian lay defeated, Rand approached, questioning the root of Jinian's aggressive behavior and speculated whether the monster Yan might be influencing his actions. Rand highlighted the shared tragedy of losing comrades to foes, suggesting a bond between them. Prepared to conclude the duel, Rand raised his sword, yet before he could deliver the final blow, Jinian activated his defensive technique, yet his barrier was inadequate against Rand's formidable sword strike. Trapped with no options, Jinian was perplexed about his next move. Unexpectedly, he expressed to Rand a peculiar sentiment, suggesting that Rand's genuine intent to defeat him was part of a test, leaving Rand bewildered by his implication. Post-conflict, Jinian disclosed his decision to forsake the hunter profession, though his quest for vengeance against Wang Fen, who annihilated his guild in the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon, remained unshaken. He then informed Rand of his new status as a high-level fugitive, ostracized from society. Jinian's purpose for confronting Rand was an invitation to a realm beyond the reach of the Hunter Association, where survival hinged on strength and a readiness to confront death. This trial by Jinian was met with Rand's impressive resilience. This realm, known as the Land of Exile, serves as a haven for those disavowed and criminalized. Together, Rand and Jinian proceeded to Jinian's residence to deliberate on their forthcoming ventures in the Sanctuary of the Forsaken. Jinian articulated his plan to accompany Rand to the Land of Exile, aiming to exact revenge on Wang Fen. In reciprocation, Rand pledged to support Jinian in realizing his objectives. Thus, they forged an alliance to pursue their shared ambitions. Subsequently, they embarked on their journey to the land of exile, opting for automobile transportation. Jinian delineated the land as a sanctuary for outlaws and exiles from across the globe, living unrestrained by laws or governance. It's a domain where inhabitants live by their primal urges and desires, mirroring the untamed nature of beasts. Although unrecognized by any official entity, its residents partake in clandestine trade dealings with various nations. Jinian cautioned that their arrival might mark a point of no return and urged Ran to sever ties with his past and welcome this new epoch. However, Ran was resolute in preserving his memories, viewing them as integral to his life's narrative and refusing to forsake them. Upon reaching the Land of Exile's threshold, they were subjected to scrutiny by the regional authorities. During the process of submitting their identification, Ran spotted a woman with distinctive pink hair discreetly observing them. She then covertly entered their vehicle, adding an unexpected element to their journey. Despite this unforeseen addition, Ran and Jinian successfully passed the inspection, gaining access to the Land of Exile, a realm inhabited by criminals, exiles, and utter lawlessness. Here, they would pursue their mission to confront their mutual adversary and achieve their individual aspirations. The narrative transitions to Mr. Traitor, who had directed the identification team to conceal Ran's entry from the Hunter Association. As Ran and Jinian proceeded into the Land of Exile, they relied on directions provided, anticipating an encounter with an ally en route. Their journey was abruptly disrupted by the enigmatic woman who had stealthily joined them earlier. Ran inquired whether she, too, was bound for the Land of Exile, revealing a high-risk grenade bomb in her possession. She insisted on being escorted to the Land of Exile, threatening a suicide bombing should Ran and Jinian refuse her demand. Despite the peril, Ran and Jinian remained unruffled, trusting in their capacity to defuse any imminent threat. To their astonishment, their progress was halted by an individual whom they accidentally collided with. The person, evidently agitated from the impact, was soon identified as part of a trio of robbers blocking their path. The leader of the robbers demanded they vacate the vehicle and relinquish their valuables. In an unexpected turn, the woman engaged with the robbers by rolling down her window. Upon their demand for money, she handed over the grenade instead, which detonated, immersing the robber in flames, all under the watchful eyes of Ran and Jinian. Witnessing the aftermath, Ran and the others were visibly astonished, unable to conceal their surprise. When the robber inquired if his appearance was altered, his associates, despite his face being scorched from the explosion and his hair in disarray, claimed they noticed no change. Exiting the car, irate and seeking retribution against the woman for her deception, they were unprepared for the revelation that followed. The woman, revealing herself as a formidable hunter through the sword she wielded, surprised even Ran and Jinian with her capabilities. She stood ready to confront the robbers, poised for the ensuing conflict. The robbers, undeterred, launched their assault, yet they quickly realized the woman's prowess. She skillfully parried their attacks with her sword, efficiently neutralizing one of their number. This unexpected turn of events highlighted her adeptness in combat, marking a significant revelation to all present. As the robbers coordinated their assault, they were abruptly intercepted by a lightning strike from Jinian, slicing Wang through their ranks and even severing one assailant's arm. Jinian effortlessly combated the robbers with his lightning abilities, neutralizing them in a singular, decisive action. The confrontation ended with the robbers' defeat, and Jinian declared his principle against allowing harm to come to a woman on his watch. The woman commended Jinian for his gallantry, a stark contrast to the feeble character she had perceived before. Subsequently, she investigated the defeated robbers, unveiling their affiliation with the notorious Stellarane Corporation. When Ran inquired about their identity, the woman explained that the Stellarane Corporation was a renowned entity within the Land of Exile, known for its specialization in weaponry and technology. The rationale behind such prominent figures engaging in robbery puzzled her, yet the group chose not to linger on the matter. Selwa introduced herself to Ran and Jinian as a libertarian, espousing the Land of Exile as a haven of freedom rather than merely a venue for economic gain. When Ran inquired about her clandestine entry into their vehicle, despite her skills as a huntress, Selway revealed her lack of a permit to navigate the Land of Exile, with plans to return to her homeland upon entry. Arriving in Ruger Town by evening, Ran and Selway decided to stop at a local bar. Despite being told by the bartender that the establishment was fully booked, Selway insisted on speaking with the owner, urging the bartender to make a call. During this moment, a young girl approached Selway, warmly embracing her and referring to her as Big Sister. The girl questioned if Selway remembered a certain promise, marking a touching reunion. Selway had previously promised to purchase a special birthday gift for the girl. With a genuine smile, Selway gave the girl her present, eliciting immense joy and heartfelt gratitude from her. The girl joyfully declared she would postpone opening the gift until noon, treasuring it as a special token from Selway. Meanwhile, the manager informed Ran and Selway that despite the full booking, they were welcome to use a back room for rest. Their discussion was abruptly interrupted by a man asserting that only Selway was permitted to stay, excluding Ran and Jinyan. This remark provoked Jinyan, who began to show signs of anger and prepared to confront the man. However, Ran intervened, reminding them of their primary objective in visiting the establishment to connect with an individual from the Deacon Light Corporation as previously planned. Despite their efforts, they encountered a setback when the corporation's representatives professed ignorance of any arrangement with Ran and his party, escalating their frustration. Just as they decided to depart, the awaited individual made an appearance. The chairman of the Deacon Light Corporation approached Ran and his allies, extending his apologies for the misunderstanding and the challenges his business was encountering. As the discussion unfolded, a formidable group stormed into the room, confronting the corporation with threats and announcing their siege of the premises. They demanded the chairman hand over crucial information immediately, threatening severe repercussions. The Deacon Light Corporation's representatives were taken aback by the abrupt invasion by these formidable mercenaries. Seeking to defuse the situation, the chairman proposed a peaceful dialogue. Yet the mercenaries' leader displayed no compassion, forcefully assaulting the bar owner. Witnessing her father's plight, the young girl courageously rushed to his aid, only to be met with violence herself. Amidst the chaos, she was struck by the mercenary leader, causing her to fall on her cherished birthday gift to slip from her hands. The leader then proceeded to seize the fallen gift, and despite the girl's pleas, he callously destroyed it right before her, showcasing a brutal disregard for her sentiments. Amidst the distressing scene, Ran and Selway remained silent, witnessing the events unfold in shock. The leader disclosed his mission to seize a coveted crystal that the Deacon Light Corporation intended to sell, a gem ardently pursued by him and his faction. Unnoticed by Selway, Ran had discreetly moved to engage the leader's accomplices stationed behind them. Demonstrating remarkable agility, Ran subdued all the henchmen and strategically positioned himself behind the leader, catching him off guard. This swift maneuver left the attackers bewildered by Ran's formidable strength and proficiency in neutralizing the adversaries promptly. Selway was equally surprised, having underestimated Ran's capabilities, and then approached the girl, offering solace. He vowed to compensate with a superior birthday gift, to which the girl earnestly requested him to fulfill his promise. Unbeknownst to Ran, this act of valor set him on a path towards a life of exile in a realm devoid of tranquility. In gratitude for quelling the chaos, the bar owner expressed his appreciation by offering complimentary drinks to the patrons, marking a gesture of thanks for the courage displayed. Seizing the generous offer, Ran and his companions decided to spend the night for some well-deserved rest. During their stay, Selway commended Ran's heroism and prowess in subduing the mercenaries, a testament to his extraordinary abilities. Amidst this, a delegate from the Deacon Light Corporation sought out Ran with a proposition. The envoy disclosed that their organization, operating within the engineering sector, required assistance to conquer the Minotaurus dungeon. The corporation's own hunters were outmatched by the challenge, compelling them to enlist Ran, a hunter of considerable repute. Ran, intrigued by the solicitation, requested further details from the representative. It was revealed that the corporation had recently engaged in a transaction with Country C to procure crystals with potential medicinal properties. These crystals were believed to inhibit the awakening of monstrous instincts within a hunter. However, complications arose during their journey from Crystal City, prompting the need for Ran's intervention. The shipment's interception by unidentified assailants led the team to trace the culprits to the Minotaurus dungeon, prompting a decision to pursue them. Throughout their expedition, they encountered a sudden ambush by demon bears, notorious for their unexpected appearances in the forest and posing a significant hazard to travelers. Faced with no alternative, the group engaged in combat with these formidable creatures. Despite their valiant efforts, they were vastly outnumbered, underscoring the perilous nature of the land of exile for even the most experienced adventurers. The Deacon Light Corporation enlisted Jinyan, Ran, and Selway for a mission into the Minotaurus dungeon, while the remainder of their party was assigned to contend with the demon bears. Upon reaching the portal, they were poised to enter the platinum-level dungeon, a testament to their hunting prowess and a chance to demonstrate their skills within the perilous confines of the Minotaurus dungeon. Distinctive in its admission limit of 5 entrants and a complex layout segmented into various paths culminating at the final boss chamber, the dungeon posed a unique challenge. Although the initial strategy involved dividing into 2 teams, Ran proposed an alternative approach, opting to navigate the dungeon's dangers solo. The Deacon Light Corporation's informant expressed apprehension about Ran's decision to navigate the Minotaurus dungeon alone. Nevertheless, Jinyan alleviated these concerns, highlighting Ran's reputation for undertaking solo ventures and affirming his proficiency in managing the platinum-level dungeon independently. Upon entry, Ran found himself in a room that, at first glance, appeared vacant. He meticulously traversed the labyrinthine corridors, memorizing his route. Unexpectedly, a skeleton cloaked in black robes emerged from the shadows, but Ran, with swift reflexes, vanquished the foe using his sword. He acknowledged the relative weakness of the dungeon's adversaries and seized this moment to refine his evasion skills in a controlled setting. While on the movie, Ran was suddenly engulfed in a burst of lightning, signaling the activation of evolution mode, a unique feature triggered by his entrance, escalating the dungeon's difficulty level. A legion of skeleton beasts materialized, yet Ran faced them with readiness, effortlessly overcoming the wave of adversaries. Opting not to press the attack further, he chose to hone his dodging abilities, skillfully avoiding the monster's onslaught with nimble and precise movements, culminating in the successful evasion of 100 attacks. Upon mastering the seamless dodge skill, Ran's agility was enhanced, granting him even smoother and swifter movements. As he adeptly navigated through the dungeon's hazards, the game system suddenly issued an alert. A hidden final boss was about to emerge. Ran's casual demeanor shifted as he braced for a formidable challenge, understanding that the skeletons were no longer his primary concern. A radiant symbol illuminated the space behind Ran, marking the entrance of the hidden boss, a creature he recognized from his encounters in the Sky Tower, yet its presence in the Exileland dungeon was baffling. This monster, driven solely by the desire for combat, devoid of any emotional or cognitive capacity, initiated a fierce confrontation with Ran. Confounded by the monster's migration from the Sky Tower to this dungeon, Ran attempted to communicate, referencing their past encounter. However, the monster was unwavering in its singular purpose to engage in battle. It then revealed its ultimate weapon by removing its blindfold, a prelude to unleashing its most devastating attack on Ran, heightening the stakes of their confrontation. Springing into action with remarkable speed, Ran aimed a precise slash at the monster's head, targeting its eye. After the assault, he noticed the monster's diminished capacity for communication, a stark departure from their previous encounter. Perturbed, Ran reflected on their last battle, recalling the brink of defeat he had faced. Now, bolstered by his enhanced abilities, he was keen to engage the monster anew, testing his improved prowess. With determination, Ran initiated his attack, but the monster skillfully parried his strike. Suddenly, ominous black portals materialized overhead, heralding the monster's impending ultimate skill. Yet Ran, with a confident smirk, remained undaunted, convinced of his invulnerability to the monster's forthcoming assault. As a luminous sword descended from the portal, aimed directly at him, Ran executed a strategic disappearance, evading this strike at the last possible moment. This tactical maneuver positioned him advantageously behind the monster, showcasing his tactical acumen and agility. Ran expressed his contempt for the hidden boss's role, recounting a previous encounter where a raid party was obliterated by a similar adversary. With a decisive stroke of his sword, Ran triumphed over the monster, continuing his exploration of the Minotaurus dungeon. Approaching the final chamber, the Minotaurus boss, undisturbed by the turmoil and a recent system glitch that empowered the monsters, awaited in silence. Anticipating backup from the Deacon Light Corporation, they speculated that the system's anomaly signaled an awakening among the arriving hunters. Jinian and a Deacon Light Corporation informant eventually made their way to the boss chamber, wearied by the intensified challenge posed by the unexpectedly strengthened monsters. Upon arrival, they were greeted by a hunter who had already reached the room, identifying himself as an adventurous hunter. He cautioned against engaging the boss monsters, citing their overwhelming strength as a formidable deterrent. This advice set the stage for a strategic reassessment of their approach to the looming confrontation. Unexpectedly, a portal materialized behind Jinian, and a contingent from an unknown group, masquerading as allies, emerged. Jinian rallied everyone in the chamber, aiming for a collective stance against the boss. However, the supposed ally swiftly betrayed them, launching an attack on Jinian. Despite the surprise assault, Jinian adeptly defended himself and overpowered the assailant. It was then revealed that the individuals gathered were motivated by the lure of the dungeon's rare crystals, prepared to confront anyone affiliated with the Deacon Light Corporation to claim them. The assailant, in a dramatic turn, exposed a monster gene crystal and underwent a transformation into a formidable beast. Rather than targeting Jinian and his companions, the transformed attacker charged at the slumbering Minotaurus. This action illuminated the assailant's desperation. Incapable of overcoming the Deacon Light Corporation's hunters, they opted for a suicide mission to awaken the final boss. By releasing the Minotaurus, the attacker accepted his own likely demise as a calculated risk, hoping to leverage the Minotaurus' might against the seasoned hunters of the Deacon Light Corporation. This perilous strategy was their gambit to overpower the formidable adversaries by harnessing the unleashed power of the Minotaurus monster. As the Minotaurus unleashed its fury, swiftly claiming the life of the attacker, a wave of horror swept over everyone present, leading to tears and dismay. In a courageous move, Jinian called upon the remaining adventurous hunters to unite and confront the formidable final boss. Yet, apprehension held them back, with concerns over potential repercussions from their employer overshadowing the immediate threat of the Minotaurus. A Minotaurus, with a resolute glare, advanced towards the hunters, who found themselves cornered, facing the grim prospect of battling for survival against this extraordinary foe. Unlike typical adversaries, the Minotaurus possessed a malevolent power. It could absorb the souls of those it vanquished, augmenting its strength with every soul consumed. This sinister ability was part of a calculated trap by the hunter maniacs, aiming to obliterate the Deacon Light Corporation's forces. Jinian grappled with confusion over the corporation's entanglement with these rogue hunters and the peril that now loomed large. As the final boss bore down on them, showing no signs of clemency, the situation appeared dire, with devastation seemingly inevitable for anyone in its path. At this critical juncture, Ran made a timely entrance, stepping through a portal that materialized out of nowhere, ready to face the impending threat head-on. Ran exhibited exceptional agility, evading a lethal blow intended for Selway with electrifying speed. The Deacon Light Corporation's hunters watched in amazement as Ran, having navigated the dungeon solo, now stood before them. The Nidawaris, fueled by rage, unleashed a barrage of attacks. Yet Ran not only stood firm but retaliated with such vigor that the boss's weapon broke apart. At his current prowess, the Minotaurus, despite being the final boss, was no match for him. Springing into action, Ran targeted the formidable creature, who braced for defense against his impending strikes. However, all preparations fell short as Ran, with grace and force, leaped into the air, his sword poised for impact. He delivered a swift, powerful blow that left the monster staggered, its very essence cleaved by the strike's intensity. Landing victoriously, Ran's decisive victory over the final boss dumbfounded the Deacon Light Corporation's hunters. The monster, once a source of dread, was effortlessly subdued by Ran, showcasing his unmatched strength and valor. Ran, through his singular efforts, emerged unmistakably superior, his prowess and finesse leaving an indelible mark on the observers. Following his victory over the final boss, Ran approached the Deacon Light Corporation's hunters with a congenial smile, proudly showcasing the loot from his conquest, among which was a rare crystal. This crystal, a key to the much-coveted Sky Tower, was a treasure many rogues longed for. The hunters were captivated by the crystal's splendor and the monumental significance of Ran's accomplishment. The narrative then transitions to the Deacon Light Corporation headquarters, where Ran and his allies were escorted post their triumphant sortie in the Minotaurus dungeon. Upon their arrival, they were welcomed by an individual engrossed in a game, evidently anticipating their return. Approaching, they were astonished to find that the individual was Andre, the chairman of the Deacon Light Corporation himself. Andre warmly acknowledged Ran, mentioning he was well informed of the hero's feats. He divulged his previous collaboration with Sanahan the Prometheus Project and expressed his gratitude towards Ran for securing the rare crystals for the corporation. In appreciation, the corporation arranged a comfortable accommodation for Ran and his companion. Jinian, however, was intrigued by Andre's youthful appearance, pondering over Sana's decision to collaborate with someone who seemed so youthful. Andre disclosed that his youthful appearance was due to the monster genes within him, which halted his physical aging, a revelation that intrigued Jinian. When the conversation turned to Suku encountered in the Sea of Forgetfulness dungeon, Ran warmly acknowledged their close friendship. Following the enlightening meeting, Ran took the opportunity to refresh himself, marveling at the unexpected hospitality extended to him in the Land of Exile. With the acquisition of the rare crystal granting access to the Sky Tower, Ran found himself closer to unraveling the mysteries of this world, perched at the tower's summit. Anticipation filled him as he contemplated the forthcoming adventures this new chapter would bring. Meanwhile, at the Exile Land checkpoint, a significant development unfolded as the head of the Hunter Police prepared to make an entrance. Tian had been assigned the mission to apprehend Ran and Jinian, now perceived as threats by the Hunter Association, necessitating prompt action. Back at the Deacon Light Corporation headquarters, Jinian approached Ran's quarters, signaling an imminent conversation with a knock. As Ran opened the door, the narrative hinted at unfolding events that could potentially alter their fates in the Land of Exile, setting the stage for the next phase of their extraordinary journey. Jinian briefed Ran on the Hunter security team's discovery of their whereabouts in the Land of Exile, alerting them to their imminent targeting. Despite being taken aback, Ran maintained his composure, puzzled over their ability to track him down, but speculated that information might have been traded on the black market, a notorious hub for the exchange of secrets for profit. Nonetheless, Ran's resolve to delve into the mysteries of the Sky Tower remained unshaken. Subsequently, Ran sought Andre's expertise in navigating the complex and perilous black market to acquire vital information. Detecting something amiss, Ran approached Andre for guidance, but Andre, hesitant, advised Ran to familiarize himself with life in the Land of Exile, suggesting that doing so would make the black market traders more inclined to share information. During a visit to Andre's quarters, the topic shifted to the origin of the rare crystals obtained from the Minotaurus Labyrinth. Ran expressed his intention to utilize these crystals for access to the Sky Tower. Andre, seizing the opportunity, proposed buying the rare crystals from Ran, offering in exchange two other crystals that could serve the same purpose. He elucidated the importance of the rare crystals in mitigating the effects of the monster gene in hunters. After careful contemplation, Ran consented to the exchange, paving the way for his continued journey. Upon arrival in Exile City of Bayil, it was astonishing to witness its thriving marketplace, contrary to expectations of scarcity and desolation. Contrary to popular belief, which attributed poverty and devastation to the area, thanks to the clandestine activities, Bayil emerges as the preeminent trade hub within the Exiled territories. It attracts not only young nobility from significant corporations, but also seasoned hunters from the three main counties, marking it as a bustling center of commerce and intrigue. Among the intrigued, the ambition to forge new alliances, especially with influential figures from large conglomerates, was palpable. Sylvia speculated that any clues regarding the entrance to the mythical Sky Tower would likely be found within this city, dismissing the previous misconceptions as folly. The consensus was clear. It was time to shift focus to their primary objective. Sylvia pointed out the towering edifice that housed the black market services, spanning from the first to the 10th floor, as their initial point of inquiry for information on the Sky Tower. This structure, standing as a beacon among the city's skyline, was about to become the starting point of their venture into the unknown. Within the towering confines of the shopping center, spanning the 11th to 15th floors, visitors are met with an array of luxury goods, high-end clothing, and essential items catering to every need and fancy. For those with a penchant for adventure, the 15th floor offers a selection of hunting gear and treasures gleaned from dungeon explorations, ensuring every explorer is well-equipped for their journeys. The 20th floor houses the pivotal Black Market Service Center, a hub for clandestine dealings and the acquisition of rare finds. An elevator provides exclusive access to the 16th through 19th floors, dedicated to the operations of the Intelligence Trade Department, where information is meticulously processed and reception functions are managed with utmost discretion. Ran, with a strategy in mind, declared his intention to proceed directly to the Black Market Service area, setting a rendezvous point in 3 hours. Sylvia, highlighting the importance of efficiency, reminded him that the quickest route to Bayil Tower lies through the old bazaar, hinting at hidden resources yet to be revealed. As Ran departed on his mission, Sylvia and Siwan found themselves alone, seizing the opportunity to delve into experiences unknown to the average citizen. Jinian, however, expressed a different pursuit, emphasizing his lack of connection to the conglomerate's elite and his aspiration to find companionship, a testament to the diverse motivations that drive the denizens of this complex city. In the bustling atmosphere of the old market, vendors showcased their wares with enthusiasm. Among them, a merchant presented a unique necklace to Tianji, crafted from bone fragments found in the dungeon ruled by the underground king. Intrigued, Tianji inquired about the authenticity of the item, expressing his intent to purchase upon confirmation of its origin. The vendor, pleased with the transaction, expressed gratitude. Tianji's aide, observing the interaction, questioned whether Tianji was too unconcerned with their surroundings. Tianji reassured him, valuing the freedom from the oppressive watch of the elders who previously stifled his movements. He mused on the irony of their current situation, now in a position to investigate the fate of Ran, known as the Awakened One, who was covertly extradited. Their mission was momentarily interrupted when the aide, startled, dropped his belongings upon spotting Ran among the crowd. As Tianji acknowledged Ran's presence with a mischievous grin, he unleashed his power, causing destruction throughout the old market. Panic ensued among the patrons. Cries of terror echoed as they labeled Tianji a murderer. Amidst the chaos, Tianji reveled in the confrontation, proclaiming his long-awaited capture of Ran. Indeed, it is often said that adversaries are destined to cross paths. In the midst of their encounter, Ran launched an attack, which Tianji countered with a defensive shield. Ran, understanding his foe's stance, hinted at the need to de-escalate the situation. Tianji, leveraging his might, declared that Ran's end would come by his hand today. Ran, undeterred, challenged him to proceed with the confrontation. Their duel was unexpectedly interrupted by a commanding voice from above, criticizing their choice of the black market as a battleground. Both combatants were taken aback to find Byron overseeing the situation, who then reprimanded them for the destruction they caused. Subsequently, in the VIP room, Ran and Tianji found themselves in a tense silence, reflecting on the events that had unfolded. Byron extended a sarcastic welcome to his city of hunters, prompting Ran to question Byron's allegiance and his claim over the city. Tianji, somewhat annoyed, revealed Byron's significant influence over the global hunters community as a monarch, a fact that seemed to surprise Ran. Byron, amused by their dynamic, remarked on their peculiar way of establishing rapport, expressing his indifference to their survival. This encounter laid bare the complexities and power struggles within the Hunter's world, highlighting the luxury and governance that underpin it. Within the complex socio-political landscape of Bale City, negotiation and deals stand as the principal means of resolving disputes. Recognizing this, Tianji asserted his singular objective was to confront Ran. Having located him, he felt compelled to fulfill his mission despite opposition. Byron, turning his attention to Ran, inquired about his aspirations. Ran articulated his desire for empowerment and a profound understanding of the essence of existence. Byron, smoking a cigar, responded thoughtfully, acknowledging the complexity of Ran's quest. He highlighted that while his own knowledge was vast, divulging such information came with significant risks and responsibilities. He warned that the pursuit of strength and truth, though noble, carried inherent dangers. However, acknowledging the logic in Ran's path, Byron questioned the underlying motive for his quest for power. Ran's response, centering on his yearning for freedom, elicited a knowing chuckle from Byron, who remarked on freedom as the ultimate luxury, encapsulating the conversation's essence and the intricate balance between knowledge, power, and the cost of freedom. Tianji likened Ran's aspiration for freedom to a child's nigh yearning for a car, questioning the practicality of such youthful dreams. Undeterred, Ran shifted the conversation towards the enigmatic phenomenon of hidden bosses appearing unexpectedly, their traits markedly distinct from those typically encountered. This deviation piqued Byron's interest, leading him to inquire if Ran was referring to an awakening experience. Ran clarified that his observation was literal, emphasizing the anomalous nature of these bosses and their uncharacteristic emergence. Prompted by this discussion, Byron tasked his assistant with conducting a search within their system for any relevant data. After a brief investigation, the assistant reported back, the system unable to retrieve information on the query, confirming their unawareness of such occurrences. This exchange highlighted the mystery surrounding these irregularities and the continuous quest for knowledge within this world, where even those with significant influence and resources encounter limitations in their understanding. Byron expressed regret for his inability to provide the sought-after information to Ran. However, he suggested an alternative path for Ran's quest for strength, conquering the Sky Tower. He highlighted that the tower's pinnacle in Bile City serves as the sole gateway to the Sky Tower across the Exile Lands. For entry, one must possess a source stone of a matching caliber. Aware that Ran holds the Limit Crystal, Byron subtly encouraged this venture. Ran found Byron's approach perplexing. While direct assistance was withheld, the encouragement to explore the Sky Tower was evident. This suggested to Ran that although the tower might not hold all the answers, it remains a critical avenue for acquiring knowledge. Despite the limitations of the information within the Sky Tower, Ran acknowledged the necessity of personal discovery. Affirming his initial plan to challenge the Sky Tower, Ran proposed a strategic shift. He requested Byron's assistance in anonymously listing the Limit Crystal for sale on the black market. This move was designed not just to dispose of the crystal, but to ensure that any potential buyer must directly negotiate with him, thereby opening a new avenue for interactions and possibly garnering the insights he seeks through the nature of the deal proposed. Byron, taken aback by the request, nonetheless agreed to fulfill it, stipulating that the black market would levy a 5% commission on the sale. Ran, acknowledging the terms, rose from the sofa, signaling his intent to depart. As he approached the exit, he paused, turning to Tianji with a cautionary note, emphasizing his deliberate approach to sharing knowledge only when absolutely necessary under duress. Upon Ran's exit, Tianji couldn't help but admire the strategic depth displayed by the younger man. He noted Ran's adeptness in both engaging and deterring with information, finding the maneuver intriguing. Byron, with a knowing smile, acknowledged the complexity of Ran's actions, suggesting he comprehended Ran's underlying motives. Initially, it appeared Tianji sought to eliminate Ran, but Byron discerned his actual mission was to investigate the enigmatic Mercury Cup. However, Byron interjected, emphasizing the burden that accompanies greater knowledge and the intrinsic roles everyone must navigate within this world, subtly hinting at the broader implications of their endeavors. Byron clarified his stance, portraying himself as a mere observer under the directive of the Alliance. With no allegiance to Tianji, he openly admitted his refusal to share information, subtly indicating their divergent paths. Tianji, reflecting on the situation, mused that Traer truly embodies his reputation not merely as an observer of events, but as a distinguished warrior and a leader commanding respect. Meanwhile, Ran navigated the corridors, overhearing a conversation between two individuals discussing unusual activities unfolding upstairs. One voiced skepticism about the feasibility of their plans, referencing rumors of a confrontation involving a red-haired individual challenging the authority of the Goldstone Group, igniting a lethal confrontation. Approaching them for clarity, Ran inquired about the disturbance. The reply painted a picture of a young red-haired individual who, in a bold or perhaps reckless move, provoked the upper echelons of the Goldstone Group. This act of defiance now necessitated his participation in a perilous duel within the arena located on the 21st floor, a scenario that piqued Rand's interest, hinting at a possible connection to himself or another tumultuous event within the city's clandestine lairs. Upon hearing the name Kai, Ron's expression shifted dramatically, signaling a deep connection or recognition. Simultaneously, in Byron's quarters, a startling update unfolded. His aide received a report, her concern evident as she relayed that anomalies Rand had earlier mentioned were indeed occurring within the exile lands. This validation came from a squad of replicant hunters from the Wilderness Crusade, who encountered an extraordinarily formidable hidden boss deep within a dungeon, a deviation from the expected raid outcomes. This entity, described as the gatekeeper of the Sky Tower's 10th floor, a formidable adversary known as the Bloody Hellraiser, was encountered prematurely, resulting in a fierce battle that tragically claimed two lives from the team. Meanwhile, a dramatic scene unfolded in a hospital, where an individual referred to only as Number 5 suddenly awakened. The intensity of his revival, marked by convulsions and gasps for air, echoed throughout the facility. In a swift response, a man administered a sedative via syringe, expressing gratitude for Number 5's contributions, albeit under circumstances shrouded in mystery and urgency. This series of events weaves a complex narrative thread, highlighting the unpredictable and perilous nature of the world they inhabit, where hidden dangers and unknown alliances form a backdrop to their quest for survival and understanding. In the confines of a sterile room, the individual repeatedly voiced his reluctance to proceed, a sentiment overlooked by the blonde man who had previously facilitated Rand's escape. After attending to the patient, he removed his gloves and informed Anna that the remedy she engineered proved effective against their descent into madness. However, he stressed the scarcity of limit crystals essential for the concoction's preparation, urging expedited collection efforts. Acknowledging his directive, Anna referred to him respectfully as Mr. Bai, promising to relay his instructions promptly. She reminisced about the day he rescued her, a moment that significantly altered her life trajectory. Mr. Bai, slightly amused by her declaration, gently reminded her that their collective goal was to envision a hopeful future for humanity. Meanwhile, the Central Tower's 21st floor became the stage for an intense confrontation within the Deathmatch Arena. As the battle commenced, the host welcomed the audience, setting the stage for a showdown of the highest stakes. This event, he speculated, could stem from a spectrum of motives ranging from personal vendettas to unresolved retributions, highlighting the multifaceted nature of conflicts that find their resolution in the perilous environment of the arena. In the arena of the Central Tower, a high-stakes deathmatch commenced, featuring two formidable opponents. The prize? A singular, highly coveted accolade, a kiss from the illustrious Wildflower of the Goldstone Gang, observed by her from a vantage point. The combatants, representatives of divergent worlds, the relentless mercenary hunters in one corner Kai Siyuan, and Zhao Safan, the affluent heir of the Zhao Corporation, and another engaged in a fierce duel that captivated the audience. Amid the electrifying atmosphere, an unexpected interruption occurred as the instigator of the duel boldly seized the microphone. Addressing the Goldstone Gang's Wildflower, he implored her to await the outcome, to which she retorted dismissively, diminishing the duel to a mere squabble and outright refusing the promised reward. This sparked a comment from an onlooker admiring her audacity yet expressing a whimsical desire for her attention, only to be reminded of her untouchable status as the progeny of one of the realm's most powerful figures. Rand, finding himself among the excited spectators, witnessed this spectacle, encapsulating the complex interplay of ambition, honor, and the pursuit of affection within the intricate social hierarchy of their world. In the midst of the intense arena battle, the crowd was captivated by the prowess displayed by Kai Siyuan, who executed a remarkable aerial maneuver, crafting a weapon from the ether to floor his adversary. Zhao Xifan, the announcer caught in the drama of the moment, declared this match a true testament to their resolve, a battle waged with no quarter given. As Kai Siyuan prepared to deliver the decisive blow, a voice pierced the tension, calling for a halt. Turning, Kai Siyuan's gaze met with Song Ran among the spectators, while Sylvia, utilizing the announcer's headset, implored Kai Siyuan to spare his opponent's life. This unexpected intervention cast a momentary pause on the proceedings, introducing a pivotal shift in the duel's expected outcome. After the confrontation, Kai Siyuan, navigating the corridors alone, pondered aloud Sylvia's motivations for intervening at such a crucial juncture, questioning the rationale behind her plea for mercy. This reflection encapsulated the intricate dance of power, ethics, and unseen alliances that underpin the vibrant and volatile world they inhabit. Sylvia expresses astonishment at his readiness to engage in conflict under the guise of flirtation, pondering whether he grasps the gravity of opposing a formidable faction within the exile lands. She reveals her intervention was driven by personal motives. He inquires about these motives just as they are interrupted by an external voice. The newcomer questions their assumption of a conclusion to their conflict. Rand challenges the notion of acetylene scores, criticizing a group's audacity in belittling individuals. Sylvia urges patience, reminding him of the debt owed for her life-saving action. His eye apologizes, attributing the provocation to their leader's insistence. The man reminisces about not seeing her for years, noting her increasing elegance and clarifying their group's stance as defenders of their interests, rather than mocker. He suggests her departure wouldn't change their predicament, emphasizing the permanence of their presence. Sylvia rejects his attempt to intervene, sternly warning that any harm directed towards Rand or her allies would result in severe repercussions. She reveals a small card implying its significant power and the grave consequences of their actions. The man queries about the card's nature, to which another explains its lethal potential. Without further obstruction, the trio departs calmly. Kai Siyuan pursues, expressing disbelief in Sylvia's willingness to employ the black card against them, despite her evolution into a professional hunter. He confesses his enduring affection for her, despite her insistence that his feelings are remnants of their shared past, and she has fundamentally changed. Kai Siyuan disputes this, blaming himself for their estrangement and vowing not to hold back in future confrontations. Kai Siyuan asserts his readiness for any challenge. 3 days later, the man visits Rand to convey news from the black market. Someone has acquired his limit crystal. Another 3 days pass, and Rand, alongside Siyuan, navigate the city's ruins. Siyuan inquires about the certainty of the buyer's appearance, to which Rand confirms, emphasizing the current scarcity of limit crystals. Siyuan expresses confusion over Rand's decision to sell these vital crystals, initially intended for accessing the Sky Tower via the Exile Lands. Rand explains the necessity, recalling their ambush by a gang of mercenaries forced into combat to seize the crystals, under duress from their commanders holding their families hostage. This incident hints at a formidable entity orchestrating these events, prompting Rand's determination to uncover the sinister cardinal. Siyuan questions if this matter is truly their concern. Recalling their search for a specific group, Rand suggests they might be dealing with the Starfall faction, puzzled by their unnecessary aggression over a crystal unrelated to their interests. He reminds his companion of their initial purpose in the Exile Lands, to gain strength and pursue Wang Fen. Despite the relative peace since their arrival, Rand speculates on the unusual calmness, considering Wang Fen's escape to this lawless territory might hinder his pursuers. The Mercury Cup, due to the vigilance of the three regional powers. Their investigation reveals that their true adversary, he had not prioritized them, reinforcing the presence of the Mercury Cup in the Exile Lands. Siyuan debates the level of concern they should afford their enemies, expressing a nuanced desire to confront Wang Fen. Interrupted by the approach of a familiar adversary, Zhao Hiwexifan inquires about their assailants. Siyuan swiftly moves to engage, signaling Rand to arm themselves. Together, they advance towards their target, weapons at the ready, determined to confront the imminent threat. Upon their confrontation, Zhao Hiwexifan, overwhelmed by fear, unleashed his psychic impact skill, triggering a formidable magical explosion. Rand swiftly subdued him, brandishing his sword in a warning gesture. Siyuan, with a mix of disbelief and reprimand, questioned Zhao Hiwexifan's audacity, highlighting his previous defeat and the unlikelihood of a change in outcome. Rand cautioned that their current challenge might not be as straightforward as anticipated. Suddenly, the rapid approach of an unknown figure caught their attention. Siyuan, quick to react, detained the newcomer, inquiring about potential backup with a grip tight enough to signal seriousness without uttering a word. However, Rand clarified his concern was not with reinforcements, but with a more pressing unease. Their suspicions were confirmed when an assailant, his face obscured, launched an attack with daggers aimed at Siyuan. Rand managed to parry the assault, expressing fears of being targeted for elimination to ensure his silence. Siyuan inquires about the implications of their situation. Rand clarifies that their strategy was straightforward. By specifying that only one individual could attend the meeting, set in the Exile Lands core, they aim to deter ordinary minions from extracting information. This approach would reveal if their adversaries sensed anything amiss with the stringent conditions, prompting them to send a scout. Their assumption was that if their foes believed the merchandise was on the black market, they would be limited to mere reports. However, the real threat lay in the orchestrator's intent to silence them permanently. Siyuan questions if orchestrating this scenario was Rand's intention, to which Rand confirms, but suggests readiness for any countermeasures. Upon an attempted assault, Siyuan neutralizes the attacker with his sword, asserting that the assailant's escape is futile. Rand finds the situation peculiar, noting that the lone arrival of their adversary signifies a strength of at least platinum level. The dispatch of an assassin implies a rank as high as Star Observer or King, indicating the seriousness of their predicament. The assailant possesses the ability to eliminate opponents swiftly, yet he merely deflects Siyuan's onslaught. This raises questions about whether he is concealing his true capabilities. The notion arises, if confidentiality is compromised, he could effortlessly eliminate all witnesses. However, his restraint suggests a strategic calculation, implying that those who operate from the shadows might take action if the information becomes public. Ran reflects on the peculiarities of the situation, theorizing that if the assailant deemed his position untenable under Siyuan pressure, he would have sought an escape or at least used the confrontation as a diversion. Now, with no apparent barriers to fleeing, his insistence on staying indicates a potential intention to attack. Ran warns that their survival seemingly hinges on the assailant's decision to depart. Otherwise, his demise is almost certain. Despite the warning, Zhao Sifan remains resolute in staying. Ran reiterates the urgency of departure, hinting at the necessity to disclose their identities, which could alter the dynamics drastically. The masked individual then forcefully distances Siyuan, signaling a pivotal moment in their confrontation. Upon observing Ran, the assailant decides to flee without a word, leaving Siyuan puzzled. He wonders if Ran knows the man's identity, suggesting he share the insight. Regrettably, Ran admits that such knowledge is confidential. Later, at the Jiguang faction's headquarters, Zhao Sifan, steadfast in his secrecy, refuses to disclose who commissioned him or the nature of the power he serves, emphasizing his commitment to safeguarding his personal secrets from them. Ran approaches, suggesting that in the absence of cooperation, they will withdraw to ensure Zhao Sifan's safety, assuring him they will release him once the situation stabilizes. Despite the offer, Zhao Sifan expresses his inability to remain confined and inquires about Sylvia. Sylvia later visits him, prompting a heartfelt conversation. Zhao Sifan reminisces about the swift passage of 7 years since their time together in Bayel, recalling Sylvia's courage and leadership. Sylvia acknowledges those times but asserts that such chapters are behind them, implying a change in their relationship dynamics. Zhao Sifan acknowledges their estrangement, questioning why Sylvia left the Starfall faction and what could compel someone to take such a step. Sylvia confirms her departure was driven by significant reasons, alluding to the intense internal conflicts within the faction. Zhao Sifan admits his recent awareness of these struggles. He queries Sylvia's trustworthiness, revealing he was tasked by the Starfall faction, which he deserted 7 years ago, to complete a mission. Siyuan expresses concern over Sylvia's safety in Zhao Sifan's presence. Ran responds with ambiguity, highlighting Sylvia's possession of many secrets and his confidence in her ability to navigate the situation. He suggests their past conflicts provide insight into the identity of the orchestrator behind their current predicaments. Siyuan's frustration mounts, demanding clarity on the matter. Ran contemplates why he cannot disclose everything, especially since the individual he encountered yesterday was Wang Fen. Intriguingly, this scent killer, discovered to be thrice as formidable as anyone else, chose not to reveal his identity. Ran deduces the involvement of River City's people in this affair, recalling his rescue by them in three different areas, though the reason remains unclear. He suspects they have a vested interest in keeping him alive. The killer, evidently superior in strength, spared the team, constrained by an unseen directive against harming Ran. Even in scenarios where Zhao Sifan or Siyuan could be potential targets, the killer's actions were deliberately restrained to avoid unveiling his identity. Ran puzzles over the killer's reluctance to flee immediately, theorizing a desire to toy with Siyuan. This behavior aligns with Wang Fen's known penchant for assessing Siyuan's quest for revenge through a test of strength. Ran reflects on the peculiar fascination with him, identifying it as a trait typical of Wang Fen. He ponders the objectives of the River City Guild, noting their lack of attempts to manipulate or demand anything from him, suggesting his actions align with their anticipations. Considering their profound understanding of his thoughts and intentions, he resolves to take proactive steps. Upon hearing Ran mention the Starfall faction, Sylvia connects it to their intense interest in the Limit Crystal, surpassing others' desire for it. She questions the link between the crystal and the faction, suspecting the motive is not immediately apparent. Despite the potential influence of his father's status, Zhao Sifan wonders about his own standing within the Xiao group. Sylvia confirms the significance of their realization and proposes they venture to Starfall, urging him to mobilize all available forces. Zhao Sifan, curious about Sylvia's plan, receives a cryptic reply suggesting they will uncover the fate of the elders following her father's demise. Zhao Sifan reveals his enduring affection for Sylvia, despite years of separation, and questions why she doesn't inquire about his compliance with their demands, revealing his father is held captive. Concurrently, within the Starfall faction, a captive man defiantly tells his captors his son will seek vengeance. A suited man dismisses his claims, stating intelligence grows with time unlike folly. He doubts the son's bravery for revenge, reflecting on unchanged behavior since childhood. Zhao Wei, leader of the Zhao group, confronts Cater, accusing him of usurping the Starfall leadership through deceit and murder. He vows retribution if his influence persists within Zhao Wei's domain. Cater retorts, diminishing the Zhao group's threat, considering them mere soldiers under his command, advising against illusions of grandeur. An onlooker, weary of their dispute, intervenes, suggesting the chaos engulfing the exile lands is nearing its end, indicating a shift in the ongoing turmoil. The consensus emerges that unity is essential, as despite their conflicts, they share common ground, all being worms as previously described. They are reminded that their actions serve humanity's broader interests. Wang Fen enters, announcing his return and reveals an unexpected source for the Limit Crystal sale, Ran with Kai Siyuan also involved. Since direct confrontation with Song Ran was prohibited, Wang Fen engaged with Kai Siyuan before making his return. The leakage of this information prompts a discussion on the ramifications, with Zhao Wei expressing concern for his son's safety amidst these revelations. Wang Fen's report triggers a debate about the strategic implications of these developments. The dialogue shifts towards the overarching ambitions of the River City Guild. The next morning, an alarm pierces the silence of the Jigang faction's headquarters, causing confusion. Siyun questions the commotion, speculating on Sylvia's and Zahoe Sifan's departure. Andre advises against premature concern, suggesting their prior conversation holds the key to the unfolding events. Meanwhile, in Zia's group, Sylvia reassures Zahoe Sifan, expressing gratitude for his company amidst the tumult following her father's demise and her uncle's power grab. Her resolve to retaliate with the military backing of Zhao's group is firm. As Zhao Sifan navigates through the crowd, he discovers the tragic fate of his father, a moment that crystallizes his mixed feelings of respect and grief for a man who balanced strictness with kindness. Reflecting on his life, Zhao Sifan acknowledges the ease and carefreeness his father's presence afforded him, creating a sheltered existence. Now, with his father's demise, he faces uncertainty about his future path and contemplates his own identity, recognizing his previous reliance on his father's strength. A subordinate reports a swift and unforeseen attack by an unknown masked assailant on their headquarters, which left them unable to retaliate in time, leading to the discovery of the tragic aftermath. Zhao Sifan is challenged with the thought of continuing to live defensively or embracing courage. The urgency of the situation is underscored by the death of a key military figure, leaving the army leaderless and vulnerable. The call for Zhao Sifan to assume leadership is unanimous among the ranks, presenting him with an opportunity to redefine his legacy and step out from his father's shadow. Recognizing his heritage as Zhao's progeny, Zhao Xifan contemplates a pivotal transformation in his role within the Zhao group. Zhao Sifan inquires about his father's military uniform, which a subordinate confirms is still in their possession, declaring that he will wear it. Zhao Sifan asserts his leadership over the group, now under his sole command following his father's death. Donning the uniform, he rallies his soldiers, urging them to channel their grief into strength for the battles ahead. Motivated by revenge and the welfare of his comrades, he stands resolute, calling for retribution. He strategizes to disperse his forces within a 50-km radius of the Starfall faction's headquarters, signaling the onset of their campaign. Sylvia is given the green light to proceed with her plans, unfettered by the recent upheavals. Meanwhile, at the Starfall Corporation, Sylvia's return does not go unnoticed. A casual suggestion to unwind is met with her sharp retort, demanding the presence of Cater, the faction's usurper. She asserts her rightful leadership, dismissing any trivialities in the face of her claim. Cater greets Sylvia, noting the time that has elapsed since their last encounter and acknowledging her growth. He expresses a misconnection, but Sylvia cuts him off, eager to discuss the current affairs of the Starfall faction, specifically regarding the Limit Source Crystal's status within the Zhao group. Cater suggests showing her reports or offering financial support, but Sylvia dismisses these as diversions, pressing for the truth behind her inquiries. Cater critiques her knowledge, attributing it to her escape from authority, comparing her ambitions to her father's, whom he deemed unsuccessful in his challenge. He argues that power is paramount, implying that one's right to influence comes from their abilities and authority. He doubts Sylvia's capability to lead the Starfall Corporation on the basis of her lineage and promises alone. Faced with Cater's skepticism, Sylvia, backed by an array of armed supporters, confidently asserts his misjudgment of her position and intentions. Sylvia clarifies her intentions are not to dominate the Starfall Corporation, but to conclude a legacy that started during the monster invasion. She explains the faction amassed a significant arsenal to combat the monsters, an effort sidelined by the emergence of hunters. The card she possesses grants her authority over these weapons, representing the corporation's true treasure. Observing the missiles, an associate alerts Zhao Sifan, now the de facto leader, signaling the onset of their assault. Zhao Xifan affirms his resolve to triumph in the conflict. Sylvia asserts that with the black card, her position within the corporation's hierarchy is secured. Andre, monitoring the situation, confirms the war's initiation, offering to share data for an in-depth understanding. Questions arise about Sylvia's departure from Starfall and the fate of a kidnapped leader, prompting discussions on allegiance. Andre suggests that in war, the complexity of corporate relations becomes secondary to the raw exercise of power, predicting a shift towards overt forcefulness in conflicts. This shift hints at a broader impact, extending beyond the immediate skirmish to challenge the foundational dynamics of power and influence within their world. During a time of heightened security, individuals seeking entry into Baal Tower are required to undergo fingerprint verification, a measure limiting access to high-ranking members only. A guard instructs a man to use the scanner. However, his attempt is denied, with a screen notification declaring his entry prohibited. Claiming to lead a minor faction and seeking refuge within Baal Tower from the impending war, the man proposes a bribe for entry. Despite his plea, he is escorted away by security. Subsequently, Ran approaches the scanner with trepidation, but gains entry, confirmed by a notification of his VIP status, suggesting Byron's intervention. Inside, Ran navigates the desolate corridors towards the elevator, pondering the implications of his access. Meanwhile, Siyuan drives through a snow-laden landscape, reflecting on Andre's remarks about the fragile equilibrium maintained among the Exile Lands factions, undisturbed by external forces until now. The unfolding chaos suggests a deliberate instigation of war, leading Siyuan to question the involvement of the Mercury Cup. Ran declares his intention to proceed to the Sky Tower, anticipating the conflict's escalation. Zhuang commits to joining the fray, aiming to unearth evidence against Wang Fen and settle old scores. Andre reminds the group of a prior arrangement with Ran. They're tasked to uncover the mastermind behind a robbery, serving as Ran's reward. As Ran enters the elevator, he reflects on the Mercury Cup's tactics. Initially, they adopted a defensive stance, avoiding direct involvement. However, Ran's growing suspicion of their involvement led to immediate turmoil, indicating their fear of his understanding their objectives. This chaos seems engineered to weaken Ran's position and indirectly dictate his actions, contrary to his independence from manipulative influences. Upon receiving VIP status, Ran is greeted warmly, highlighting the special access granted to him, a mark of significant recognition or perhaps an orchestrated move to align with his investigation into the war's orchestrators and the complex web of alliances and motives in the Exile Land. Ran resolves to align with the unfolding events, planning to seize the right moment to shift the dynamics to his advantage. He prepares for ascent to the Sky Tower's top floor, poised to fulfill the expectations laid before him, albeit in his own strategic manner. Meanwhile, in a secluded location, an observer monitors a figure within a water flask, noting the successful synchronization and stabilization of the soul, marking the commencement of the next phase in soul fixation. Bai inquires about the war's progress, and Anna reports escalating tensions, with the Starfall faction and allied groups intensifying the conflict across the Exile Lands. Bai reveals holding 18 souls, signifying Song Ran's advancement to the Sky Tower's 180th floor. The so-called monsters are unveiled as beings from another realm, their original world ravaged, prompting their invasion through a portal linking their dimension to ours. This incursion, however, spurred human avarice, revealing a darker aspect of humanity's nature. Humanity's quest for the advanced technology wielded by the monsters led to a pivotal decision. The King of Monsters, or more accurately, the Mother Specimen, was preserved rather than destroyed. This choice underpinned the construction of current systems, including the Hunter system, which integrates the consciousness and technology of the Mother Specimen. However, the complexity of controlling such a powerful entity means that absolute assurance of safety remains elusive, prompting ongoing efforts towards developing an artificial substitute even before the initiation of the Promethean Plan. Attempts to modify Hunters to harness the Mother Specimen's system met with failure, as those who came close to understanding it were driven to madness. One individual, who nearly bridged the gap to this artificial divinity and posed a solution to the subterranean city's challenges, ended up overwhelmed by the system. This person, wielding a weapon capable of evolving in myriad forms, became a crucial figure in the ongoing narrative. Upon hearing this, Anna inquires if the reference is to Ran's evolutionary blade, highlighting the significance of this weapon, not just as a tool of combat but as a potential linchpin in understanding and possibly overcoming the complexities and dangers associated with the Mother Specimen's legacy. Bai articulates the paradox of humanity's fascination with monster technology as aligning with the Mother Specimen's intentions. The consciousness embedded within the system visualizes a manager for the Heavenly Tower, Doris signifying that both the deranged Hunters and the sentient monsters are manifestations of the Mother's desire to amalgamate her progeny with humanity. This is the end. Leave a comment, Song Ran, below if you want us to do next part.